Meanwhile, the show has begun.
Wow.
And it's not the Opie and Anthony show that we're talking about. What the fuck?
Well, that's what video conferencing's all about, isn't it, Opie?
That's right.
Hi, welcome, good morning, Opie and Anthony.
Blah, 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 sound effects, blah, blah, blah. Let's get right into it.
Yeah.
First of all, we got to say hi to Kevin Smith, who's in studio. He just stopped by to say hi.
Hi, Kevin.
And good morning.
He just walked into all sorts of things here.
Yeah.
That's not a bad thing to walk into.
That's good, right?
Walk in the room, look at these two people talking.
Yeah, they're just banging away on here. Map of Hawaii is their name. They're on the Pal Talk. We have our own Pal Talk room. It's Opie and Anthony Live.
So everyone can see this?
Yeah, yeah. And we have a camera right up there.
No, the
looks over the whole
show.
Thing. Yeah, the fuck show. Very important.
Because everyone's watching. Nobody's watching.
No one's
the
watching
studio portion
us in
right
here
now.
Anymore.
They're like,
no.
Oh my God, look at this dude.
They have this picture up full size, full screen. And
I gotta tell you, it's a tough decision, though. Check out Kevin Smith on the Opie and Anthony program, or a couple fucking.
Let's look at a sausage party room full of dudes.
Right.
Or this dude actually getting a chick.
Well, I'm looking at the office cam at Steve's smiling face right there in the office. Doing no work is being done in the office right now.
He wishes he was her.
Well, this started with an email over the weekend from E-Rock.
Yeah.
And E-Rock brought it to our attention that this fine couple would be having sex live on our show today with their Pal Talk camera.
Yes.
And
The whole show or just as long as, until he's done?
As long as he lasts.
Really?
That's a very good question. I don't know.
He was doing a good portion of eating out before he even started.
Yeah, a little this. Foreplay.
Yeah.
Foreplay while Ecstasy of Gold was playing.
Uh-huh. Advertising himself as a generous lover.
Right.
Right.
He gives a little.
Smart move.
He gives a little. And then now he's got her. She's on her back. Her legs are up.
It's an uncomfortable looking place, though. She's on a table. I understand. It's a
kitchen table.
Yeah, but they just threw a sheet over it. Not.
Yeah, what's up with the table?
That's why he ate her out. He's making up for the fucking table.
I think as far as direction goes, it's probably a better location than the bedroom.
It beats the bed, too, because the bed, you kind of sink into the mattress a bit. This will give you a better view.
Better view of everything. You're not losing anything by sinking in.
How many people are in the Pal Talk room?
I don't know right now.
I think the numbers are going to go way up all of a sudden.
That is fantastic.
I would say maybe 300-400 are in the room right now, but those numbers are going to go up very fast.
The thought behind it, they actually had to set their alarms to wake up, probably take a shower,
get all ready,
and then get to the fucking.
There were just 319. Now there's 352. It's leaps and bounds here.
He keeps slipping out. Man.
Kevin, you're a big time director. What do you think? I mean, are
How's
they directing
doing?
This well?
I think it shot pretty well. That's how I would shoot it. Yeah. You know, still camera, no action. Just
still camera,
set it
no
up
moves.
And let things happen in front of it.
You like the lighting and everything?
I go for a bit. I really bathe it in tons of light so you can get all those shadows out of there and see everything.
Yeah, he's getting a few reflections off the window.
She's a pretty large labia.
Well, he's
it's really lovely.
It's and he's keeping the boom mic out of the shot.
You're ruining it, dude. You're ruining it.
He's moving the telescope in the apartment. We saw that. Well, it's not like he's on a dolly and can really kind of move this around.
That's true. He's multitasking. Give him a break, kids.
Can we get their audio or what? Sometimes you can get their audio.
Well, we can give it a try. Hey, Map of Hawaii, I will give you the audio. Let's see.
By the way, his chick is very fine.
Oh,
she's all right.
Really,
she's kind of attractive.
Because when E-Rock said that a couple wanted to have sex with the Pal Talk camera today, I was like,
you have attractive fans.
All right.
You have attractive fans. If I had a couple fans, fucking.
All right, here we go.
Let
me go over
look like
here.
Me.
All right, this is live audio as they
there. Here they are,
have
fucking.
Sex.
See, now the pressure's on to produce some dialogue.
Yeah, it was great when it was just pictures.
Totally.
All right, we got some action.
There you go. She's turning it up a little bit.
Wow. I think the whole world needs to get Pal Talk. What? What can I do? I can pop it. I got it.
Oh, good.
I like watching people have sex.
Oh, God.
Isn't that great?
Kind of an understatement, but yeah. I
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
I don't watch that. Jeez.
Look at Steve's face in the office. I'm checking out the action. I'm checking out Steve in the office. No one is working.
Is that it?
Uh-oh, was that it?
I don't think so.
Good girl.
I think, oh yeah, a little loving. That's nice.
A little loving, that means it's over.
We'll make it out.
There must be some love there to be like, honey, we're going to fuck on Pal Talk. Well done, kids. Well done.
Wow. All right.
Huzzah.
Huzzah. What a way to start the Opie and Anthony program.
Very nice.
That is fantastic. Wow, big tit shot on the camera. And the family doesn't know when they come over to have Thanksgiving dinner that that took place on their table.
Totally.
That's
this
great.
Turkey's great.
And cut. Did I do well, Kevin?
Not bad.
You were
I would,
right about
I would
there,
keep rolling in case something else happened.
You never know, right?
Yeah.
Well, you got to keep rolling for the DVD, you know?
Totally.
Get some extras in
the
there.
Extras.
And now there she is smiling on
she
camera.
Is. Can She's we got that fresh fucked look.
Can she call She's a program pretty. So we can talk to them now?
Yeah.
If totally, they're listening, call the show.
Totally pretty chick.
Yeah, call the show so we can talk to you guys, see what you're all about.
Yeah, call up. Call the show, and we would love to talk to you.
That was a nice
Very
surprise.
Good. All Very right. nice.
Now we have to regroup. Tony in Queens, what's up?
Hey, O&A, how you doing? Hey, Jimmy.
Yeah.
Jimmy, I was at your show on Saturday. That you killed, Jimmy. I was at the 8 o'clock show, me and my girl. Unbelievable show, Jim.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, Jimmy played Albany all weekend long. That went well, Jimmy?
Yeah, it was cool, man. It's a shitty, boring town, but I mean, you know, the gigs were good.
There's nothing to do.
That's awful. It's all. We went to a strip club, and that was all we did.
I was there with that little Corvette group that was very shocked at your humor.
Oh, there was a bunch of, like, 60-year-old people that were part of a Corvette group. They all, like, drove Corvettes. And
what, they just stumbled into the show, had no idea
they had
what
no
they
idea
were
what a
going to see?
Yeah, slob they were about to watch. So, you know, it was good.
Did they walk out?
No, they stayed. There was, like, 10 of them.
Were they really annoyed?
Slightly through a lot of it, yeah, through the Monster Rain shit. And a lot of, they just didn't want to hear a lot of it.
Yeah, the Monster Rain stuff is, you know, some cute stuff, though.
Yeah, well, they didn't find it adorable.
Fucking All right, Jimmy. Thank you, Tony.
All right, take it easy, guys.
I'm sorry, but the Map of Hawaii couple really fucked us up as far as our rhythm and energy go, so we'll get it together here now. Brian in Brooklyn, what's up?
Why the fuck did I leave for work early today? I was on Pal Talk last night, and Map of Hawaii had a boobs out all night. I wanted a little pre-show, and I missed the whole sex, the whole action.
Well, don't they, like, tape all these now, and then it'll be shown later or something, Ant?
I have no
idea
what
they do. There's a whole underground network going, you know.
I think that.
You know.
I think someone might do some caps.
Somebody had to capture that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, though.
They banged yesterday, though. Their schedule's really weird. You have, they, like, it was, like, yesterday in the afternoon. I just turned it on. It's, like, 4 in the afternoon, and they're fucking. It's all they do.
That's all they do.
That's all they should do. Look at her.
Don't they have to go to work or anything? They got to call the show.
That apartment actually looks kind of nice.
It's nice, right? The view?
Yeah, it's like a view and whatnot. So.
Yeah, where are they from?
Floor-to-ceiling windows.
Independently wealthy couple, I guess.
Greg in D.C., what's up?
Yeah, is this the beginning of a new bit called Moaning on Mondays? We've already got the Whip 'em Out Wednesdays.
Yeah, you need that radio catch thing where you have to have an M word and then Monday a T word
exactly.
and Tuesday.
A lot of alliteration.
Yes.
Exactly. The problem is our
makes it that much better.
Fucking on Friday.
Well, your listeners don't know what the word alliteration means, so you might need to explain that one too.
Our listeners are very competitive, too, so they're going to try to outdo
each other. Let me tell you
something.
I respect their listeners a lot more after watching that display.
Yeah.
They may not know what alliteration means, but they sure know how to move that camera around.
All right, let's go to Eric in Bethlehem. Eric.
Oh, hey there. I was at the Javits Center this weekend, and I saw Big Kev. And let me tell you, he was just a great guy. He really represents the program well.
Oh, look at that.
It was sweetheart.
He was totally cool, and also, got to mention, Kevin Smith saw you there this weekend, also fantastic.
I didn't represent the program well at all.
No, you could have done a little bit better.
I really should have.
Could have fucked on a table
totally.
Or something.
Right, I had a table, too, and why didn't I think to use it
yeah,
like that?
Come on.
That was the comic book convention, again, right?
We're selling purchased some things from the Jewish Q booth. And,
oh, I appreciate that, sir. Send my kid to college one day.
You guys are great. The program rules, and let's keep spreading the virus. I'm punching out.
All right, thank
Bye,
you,
fella.
Sir.
How interactive are you guys with the message boards and everything these days? I know at one point you were pretty
deep.
Yeah,
I'm always there.
Still?
I get on once a day and answer questions.
Yeah, I pop over to the website and check it out, and you're pretty... attentive.
I do. I'm like this dude. Yeah. I eat him out for a while before I ask him to fuck.
Give him the good fucking.
Well, I don't know if the fucking's any good, but I give him the fucking. That's it. But yeah, I spend a lot of time on the web. Without those cats, I ain't got a job.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't have fans like this, though, sir.
No?
No. Not
no,
that
they're all different types. But we do the same thing here. Like, I'm on
you guys fuck on a table?
Yeah, fucking on the table for the listeners. You got to give.
Awesome.
You got to give a little bit.
Eat a little ass, go right into the fucking.
You got to be willing to eat a little ass.
Totally.
But, I'm on there a lot and stuff, and you find that it does kind of, it makes a difference. You only think you're hitting a few people here and there, but it really does make a difference.
Word gets out that you actually spend time there. And the upshot to that is that, you know, a bunch of people come. The downside is that a bunch of assholes can come as well.
Yeah, yeah. Now, how do you take that?
For years, I used to just take it. We used to have people jump on and be like, you suck. You suck cock and spell cock wrong. Take a lot of shit. And then one day we decided to institute a message fee to join the message board. $2, and it goes to charity. Mm-hmm. Goes to RAIN, the Rape and Incest Charity. And you would be surprised it cut down 98% of the bullshit. People, when forced with the idea of paying $2 to call you an asshole, they're like,
just
it's not
$2,
worth it. Right? They're like, it's not worth it. And the ones that will pay the $2 that really want to call you an asshole, they'll pay, and then they get on there and they say their piece, and then you delete their piece and keep their $2 and throw them off the website. Because it's not like that $2 joins you for life. It just joins you for as long as you're good.
Sometimes you do have to wield an iron fist.
You have to, and some people are like, oh, you should take it. Don't be a pussy. And it's like, life's too short to take that.
Dude, this is censorship, man. And we should have the right to... No, it's our message board.
Exactly.
Or it's this guy's message board that owns it, and it's his right to put up or take off whatever the fuck he wants.
No free speech there, exactly.
No, not on a message board. And why, like on a fan site, should you have to take that kind of abuse...
Why? Who? I mean,
it shouldn't be an ass kiss site, but I mean,
and that's what it hopefully it remains for the rest of my life. But why on earth? Like, if you don't like something, do you ever go seek it out and be like, I don't like you? Don't you just ignore it?
No. If someone beat up my mother,
right,
and made a website about it,
right,
I'd probably write in
post
and be like,
it.
You're a fucking asshole.
Or be like, I disagree with this website.
Yeah, I completely don't like this. But aside from maybe something like that, I could give a shit.
Exactly.
Yeah. But there are people there, you know, these fucking guys, man, they talk about this too much, or they do this, or prima donnas complain about the equipment not working.
We have some fan sites that don't have any fans on them anymore.
No. It's just complete bashing.
And then they get pissed off that we don't promote them on the show. I'm like, why would we promote you guys? You're not fans anymore. It's obvious. We know who our fans are.
Yeah.
If you go to a message board that's supposedly an Open Anthony fan site, and over 75 to 80% of all postings are negative, how is that a fan site?
Yeah.
And why should we promote it?
You guys just can't take criticism.
Oh, angry typing guy.
That was kind of like irritated typing guy.
That was irritated typing guy. Only Obi does angry typing guy. I mean, anytime he talks about it.
Yeah, we understand it shouldn't be a kiss-ass thing, like you said,
but it should be a kiss-ass thing. Why not? Like, why not? Can't there be one place in the world where you go and get props for what you do and people are happy with you and whatnot that's filtered out all the assholes?
All the assholes?
I think there should be.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's rough, though, sometimes. I like the idea of being able to turn someone around.
Right.
I've done that in the past. It's kind of hard.
I used
to
enjoy that because I've been doing this. I've had a message board now. We started in 96, so what, 10 years mm-hmm. now. I used to enjoy trying to turn people around. Not anymore.
Yeah,
no. I mean, it's like if you don't like it, you don't like it. You know, I can't spend all my time, waste all my time trying to fucking convert one person because I've done that so many times. And the wife would just be like, I can't believe you spend all your time trying to convert fucking Wampa One instead of coming in here and fucking me. And I'm like, yeah, why am I doing that? I'll never meet this guy. I'm not going to fuck this dude on a table. I'm not going
to
convert this
I used to do that as well, but now I just write him back and just write, oh, well.
Yeah, that's my philosophy.
That's my reply.
Now is just like,
they trash,
do you feel
trash,
better?
Trash. I hate you fucking, blah, 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 and I just reply, oh, well.
That's why
that burns, too. They'll hate that because they're like, I wrote all that. You wrote two fucking words. Right. This is why I don't like you.
That's why that scene was so cool when you guys just went to the houses and just
beat
started beating
people.
The shit. And they're all like 12-year-old kids and you punched them in the face.
The people like, that don't like our stuff on the internet really like cite that movie as being childish.
Yeah.
Which is, I think, ironic.
Yeah, a bit.
They don't like that scene particularly.
Hey, we got to break into this conversation and talk to Katie from Pal Talk.
All right.
She just got laid. Katie!
Yes.
Very, very nice.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thanks.
A big star got to see you guys have sex.
I know. We didn't know Kevin Smith was going to be here.
Hardly a big star. I was a big star while you were fucking. Very big in my pants.
Very nice.
That was tremendous. Yeah. Why? So you guys woke up early, set an alarm to do that?
Yeah, well, we got to go to work, but it was definitely scheduled.
So what do you guys do, if you're not comfortable saying, although you just fucked on the internet, so I can't see how you wouldn't be comfortable saying what you do for a living.
I'm a financial advisor.
Awesome. Invest in Pal Talk.
So he's used to fucking people.
Exactly. On a regular basis. And what do you do, ma'am?
I work in a doctor's office right now.
Oh, tremendous.
That is great. And it looks like you guys are doing pretty well. What state are you from?
We're out on Long Island.
Yeah.
You're on Long Island.
Strong Island, as we saw this morning.
Wow, damn.
But you have a telescope.
That's kind of nice. Nice place for Long Island.
The telescopes are for Manhattan, I thought.
Yeah, Long Island.
Right? No, we're way out east. We're right on the Sound, so we look over at Connecticut with it.
Yeah.
That telescope was an award they got for fucking on the internet. It was the first prize in an internet fucking contest.
So there are people in Connecticut looking at you.
They're actually using the telescope to look at stars.
Can I ask what made you want to do it? I guess there's a bit of an exhibitionist streak running through both of y'all.
You know what? We actually got our camera yesterday. We signed up for Paltech Talk since you guys were talking about it so much on the show. And just got hooked immediately.
Yeah, immediately.
Now, is there any fear of repercussion, like family seeing this or something like that?
Yeah, a little bit. It's kind of hot.
So it's the danger that makes it interesting.
Yeah.
Good to know.
I don't think anyone in my family would be on here, so.
Nah.
Where do they live?
Close.
They don't have XM?
No.
No, I don't. I want to get it, though. I will.
If I was banging her, the first thing I'd want to do is get a camera and show everybody. She's fucking solid.
Yeah, she's
the first
very
thing
attractive.
I do.
She's look more than solid, sir. She's solid is what, a 6, 7? She's
eight, for
nine.
Me, a solid is more in the 9 area.
Really?
No, not for my own life. Just in general. 2.5 is fine, but when observing on film.
How long have you guys been dating, or are you married?
No, we've been dating for about a year and a half.
A year and a half. So I guess the dream is to have some ex-girlfriend or boyfriend cruising around Pal Talk and be like, oh, my God.
Okay, I know. That's what I mean.
Let her go.
Oh, yes. The boyfriend, an ex-boyfriend just going, hey, you know, I heard about this Pal Talk. Let me, oh, shit. Oh, no.
The ex-girlfriend is just like, I can't believe he ate her pussy.
Yeah, that's pretty nice of you there, dude, giving a little bit beforehand.
That's smart. That's called marketing, sir.
Yeah.
Just in case things don't work out, be like, you may have seen me on Pal Talk eating my ex-girlfriend out.
You got to give her a little something on the front end.
They just got the camera, yesterday? You already had sex 2 or 3 times?
We got it 2 days ago. Yeah, we've had sex like 3 times on it.
Because, Jimmy, you saw them having sex last night too, right?
It was yesterday sometime, yeah. It was lovely.
Did you jack off to it?
Today, no, it was in the... But then I was like, you know what? Let's just do it. Got a little excited.
No, I didn't bang because I still don't have shades, so I'm in that open, like, fishbowl room, so I just have to kind of squeeze my mule through my sweats under my desk.
you're
a creep.
You are despicable.
I know, it's people can look in from all these windows and see me.
Do you think there's a point where it's not going to be enough, that you have to take it to the next level, a.k.a. anal?
Oh, he's been trying.
Yeah. No doubt, man.
Who hasn't?
If there's blood in his veins, he's trying.
How old are you, wacky kids?
I'm 22.
I'm 25.
Right
22,
on. Where'd you guys
25.
Meet?
In a spa.
Yeah.
Which
I worked in the salon, and he came in. We went to the same school, though. Graduated different years.
Want to plug that school? Because I'm sure they'd be proud to see two of their alma mater out there really making it
in
the world.
I think you'd like to see this clip on classmates.com, baby. Then and now.
Did you guys know each other when you were in high school, or you were a few years apart?
Yeah, we didn't know each other through high school.
But he would be, a senior when you were a freshman?
Yeah.
Mm. Right on. And you had no idea that one day you'd be fucking this upperclassman on the internet. Life takes weird turns.
These guys are the stars of Pal Talk, though. They've only had a camera a couple of days, and everyone knows who they are now.
There's going to be a little jealousy on Pal Talk, though.
That's what I'm thinking.
There's going to be some jealousy and some people shit talking because, those guys talking shit yesterday. It's like, what are you doing? They just banged for you. What's the matter with you?
How could they possibly
criticize?
Who's complaining?
I mean, I can see like the conservative side, the moral majority criticizing, but if you're on Pal Talk and if that bugs you, you wouldn't be looking at it in the first place.
There's
who would possibly criticize
there's
that?
A section on Pal Talk for talk, liberal, conservative. Mm-hmm. There's like talk where you could sit there and talk about the issues and,
right.
and everything. And then there's adult section with the video like this.
The
people
only
fucking.
The only criticism I would have is why have they only fucked 3 times in 2 days? This needs to be happening all the time.
We're trying.
Got to earn some money, I guess.
Well,
go to work.
Is it a long commute?
Yeah, where do you work? Manhattan?
No, I work on Long Island.
Yeah.
There's no way they would
actually not too far from F.H. Riley's. We're going to go next week.
Yeah, we'll be there.
Oh, Jesus no. Christ. You just
Thank
gave the
you.
Best plug.
Thank you.
Opie's Brothers Restaurant, F.H. Riley's. You guys are going to be there what day?
We're going to go on Saturday for the karaoke thing. But listen, since there's so many weird guys on the internet looking at my girlfriend naked, could you guys bring Master Poe to protect her?
We're going to have Master Poe there, Club Soda Kenny. It's going to be a great night.
You'll have all kinds of protection, believe me.
We're talking about late night karaoke at F.H. Riley's this coming Saturday night. 400 New York Avenue in the heart of Huntington, yes.
So I guarantee you nobody will hassle her because I'll be standing right behind her whacking my bag.
That's fine.
Jim's
going
to have to be removed.
No, just.
Well, that's wonderful.
And sir, don't discount the amount of guys who will be eyeballing you as well.
Yeah,
they've seen your gear.
It's so true.
The guy's packing.
I turned it on. I'm like, who's putting a leg in that girl's vagina? Oh, it's a stick.
Isn't that the weird thing? Like, we all watched them fuck, and we watched it. Once he pulled out his cock, nobody said, hey, that's a really good-sized cock. Because nobody wants to say that's a good-sized cock.
No.
In case somebody in the room goes, that cock's small. You know?
Yeah.
Nobody wants to admit that, like, wow, that cock made me a little
impressed. Poor son of a bitch.
No, right. You're just afraid that your voice will crack while you're saying it and it will come out wrong. That's quite a cock.
That cock looks delicious.
That's so funny.
Yeah. Well, thanks again. We'll look forward to seeing you on Pal Talk and Saturday night at F.H. Riley's. Wow.
We'll be there.
God bless your union, kids. Keep on doing it.
Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Bye. Bye. There they go.
Bye.
The stars of the show already.
Put your clothes back on.
Lovely. We've talked about it in the past, how someone must have approached the patent office, software company, the first idea of video conferencing and just been, this is great. You know how Bob has to go over to Japan every couple of weeks and meet with the Wasaki people? We can now do it online.
Right.
And the very next thing was, and people can fuck. You know damn well. The pitch was all business, but then when we come down to the reality...
The secondary market was like, could you imagine watching Bob fuck his wife?
Yeah.
Real time.
In Japan.
Before the meeting.
All right. The phones. Wow. Let's see. Let's start with this over here. Mr. Motherfucker from Whackbag.
Oh, yeah. I just wanted to ask Kevin about what Brian Johnson is up to these days.
Brian Johnson, a friend of mine, a guy that made this movie called Vulgar.
I saw Vulgar.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Trippy
I
flick.
Saw Vulgar.
Brian has been in Jersey for the last, I guess it's coming up on 5 months. I'm going to see him tonight, actually. And he's going to be coming west again. He was living in Los Angeles for a while. He's been writing the next flick he wants to do.
Yeah. I just want to thank him for, I was at Wizard World in Chicago, and he took part in something that I shot where I tried to get a few celebrities to wish Jim Norton a happy birthday.
Right on.
Oh, thank
you. And that was pretty cool, so.
He's a good guy. He's a tremendous dude. Funny guy. Yeah. One of the funniest people I've ever known in my life.
Oh, yeah. Bye. Anyway, I'm punching out.
All right, thanks.
Thanks, man. I did see some of that footage, too, by the way. Thank you.
Punching out who?
No, just punching out.
Oh,
as in, he has nothing else to offer.
That's it.
And he wants to get out before he crashes.
Yeah. That was a good move, man.
A lot of people don't do that, though.
They'll just hang on there and be like, so.
They hang out. Their jet goes right in, and then they go, I'm punching out. And it's like, no, you're flaming fuel and metal.
Yeah,
it's done.
I like to punch out.
Some people, they try to be humorous on the show, and they stop, and they go, but punching out.
Right.
And that's legit. He reached between the legs, pulled it, the canopy went, flew out, he's fine.
Right.
His joke, you know, into the ditch, but some people don't know when to punch out.
I think
out.
You unload and you get out quick.
Yeah.
Hey, going back
pull
to the Vulgar movie, how'd you get that in Blockbuster?
You know, they did 2 cuts of that movie, one that we did theatrically. And
I saw
the
clean cut then?
You saw the clean cut.
No way.
If you got it from Blockbuster, we had to do an R-rated cut because they don't carry
NC-17
movies. Yeah.
That movie was deeply disturbing.
Yeah, they cut some stuff
I could
out.
Not believe I got in Blockbuster to begin with, but you're telling me there's a dirtier version out there.
Yeah, the clown rape scene goes on a little bit longer.
That's what I thought it should have.
You're sitting there going, this movie would be all right if they just
quick.
Push the edge of the envelope.
It should absolutely go longer.
Very twisted.
Yeah, why did you decide to make Vulgar?
Brian wrote the script and he directed it. All I had to do was throw some money behind it.
Right.
I just thought it was funny.
That's what I mean. Why'd you get behind it?
The script, to me, who can't get behind clown rape, sir?
Yeah.
Especially male-on-male clown rape. You see so many rape movies that it's just the standard with a guy and a girl, but why not switch it up and go the other way, equal time? And the script to me just played like Brian Johnson on a page. Mm-hmm. Like it was just my friend kind of splayed out there on a page, and every line just reeked of him and made me laugh. So I was like, oh, I can get behind this. Plus it felt like a real like 70s exploitation kind of flick.
Totally.
Totally loved it.
What do you think of Jason Lee with My Name is Earl?
My name is Earl. Thank God, you know, the rest of the world seems to have caught on to Lee. It's great.
Does he call you and thank you?
He's always been very incredibly gracious.
Yeah.
But it was nice when, right before the show debuted, like, there were billboards for that show.
Huge for it.
In
so
Los
it was
Angeles,
like,
I really couldn't drive like 5 blocks without seeing Jason Lee's face all huge, and that just did me proud.
Yeah.
That made me feel like a smart guy. I was like, I cast that dude.
I think he's fantastic. And I was a little scared when I saw all this hype, thinking, oh, shit. You know,
it can't live up to it.
It can't live up to it. He is too goddamn funny.
He is so charming. The show rests solely on his shoulders.
Yeah.
And he's very charming at its epicenter.
Yeah.
So it kind of works.
And
Ethan's funny, too. Ethan Suplee plays his brother.
And just the thought that he has to walk around with that mustache and that hair all the time.
I know.
Really cracks me up.
He came in and did a day for us on Clerks 2, and he showed up in his mustache, and I was like, well, dude, we're going to have to shave that mustache. He's like, I can't do it, dude. This is the money. It's like, I'm kidding, sir. I'm kidding.
It's like Burt Reynolds' mustache back in the 70s.
Totally. He finally has his Reynolds stash. It's gotten like that mustache has become so identifiable that, like, you know, those articles were like, who should be cast in this movie? They were talking about doing a Magnum PI movie. They're like, top choice should be Jason Lee. Why? He's got the mustache.
Mustache, man. He's
never
got the
mind
Magnum.
Whether or not he's good for the role. He just has little facial hair, and that'll do it.
What about Clerks 2?
Clerks 2, August 18th comes out.
August 18th?
Yeah.
Happy with it?
Love it.
Yeah.
I think it's really, really funny.
Yeah. Saw the trailer. Not much info in the trailer.
Yeah, well, teaser.
A lot
more
of
so than trailer.
Teaser. Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
teaser.
Just give you a general flavor of what it looks
like. And it's great to see everybody again.
Yeah.
I'm definitely looking forward to it.
I love it, sir. I'm not going to oversell it. I love it. I think it's funny, and it's really raunchy. It pushes the edge of the envelope very, very far. I don't think we're going to get a rating, because we know we can't get an R. So rather than go out with an NC-17, we're just going to go out unrated.
Unrated.
Yeah, because ironically, you get an NC-17, nobody gets into your movie, you know, under 17. But if you're unrated, a 5-year-old could buy
it. What are the restrictions to, like, unrated? Like,
there are no restrictions. Unrated means you haven't gone through the
MPAA. Yeah, why wouldn't everyone do that?
Because
then?
Most studios are signatories of the Motion Picture Association of America, so they have to get a rating.
Oh.
So most of your independents aren't, you know? And that's why films that come out, like The Aristocrats, was independently distributed, and so they had no rating whatsoever.
So
the risk you run is there are some chains out there, some theater chains, that are like, well, we won't take an unrated flick. But we weren't looking for, you know, 3,000 screens anyway. I'd be happy with 1,000 screens. I know there are 1,000 screens out there. Wouldn't mind programming our flick.
What kind of goods are in there that might get you an NC-17?
It's not, again, it's not even like, it's certainly nothing like the couple on Pal Talk. You know, there's nothing visually titillating. It's just all the stuff they talk about.
Yeah. Conversation-wise,
it's conversation.
Dialogue.
That's the weird thing in this country is you can get away with showing people get blown away and chopped up in an R-rated movie.
Yeah, we talk about that all the time.
The moment
it's
you start
amazing.
Talking about sex, they get really antsy, give you an NC-17.
How many people are in the MPAA? How many? What is that?
There's a great documentary that just screened at Sundance, and it's going to be on. I think it's on IFC. Yeah, it's going to be on IFC this year, and it's called "This Film Is Not Yet Rated," made by this guy named Kirby Dick, and it's about. The ratings process and how it works, and it's shrouded in secrecy. You don't know who's on the MPA. You don't know who's screening or rating your film. And Kirby spends the whole movie trying to track down and identify the people that are actually on the MPA, and hires two detectives to like follow them. And really, by the end of the film, does identify them. I mean, hopefully, I'm not spoiling it. And then the rest of the film is made up of interviews of filmmakers who've gotten an NC-17 for ridiculous shit.
Yeah, most people have no clue.
That's the thing. Like, I've been through that process so many times. Like, getting a film rated 6 times. Twice I've had ratings that I've actually had to go in there. 3 times that I've had to go in there and fight. Twice I actually went in and fight. On Clerks, they gave us an NC-17, and we went through the appeals process, and we got that overturned to an R without cutting the flick.
That was
and on
pretty
Jersey
much
Girl,
dialogue.
That was
right?
all dialogue. Yeah. Jersey Girl, which is a film that is so fucking tepid. You know, there's nothing in that film that's by any stretch of the imagination like R-rated mm-hmm. territory, and they gave us an R based on a conversation that Ben Affleck and Liv Tyler have in a diner about masturbation. Holy and I was just shit. Like, are you insane? Like, we don't even use, colorful euphemisms for it. Like, you know, bopping the bishop or something. Even some mm-hmm. lame shit like that. It was all clinical terms.
Yeah.
And still, the one of the raiders, I think her name was Joan, when I spoke to her afterwards, she goes, look, I would not be comfortable with my 16-year-old daughter sitting there listening to Liv Tyler talk about masturbation. I'm like, your 16-year-old daughter is rocking the shower head, I assure you, every morning. Don't worry. She can hear this because she does far, far worse, finger banging.
I love when they pull their personal little...
Totally, but that's the thing in the doc, which is amazing, is that when they identify these people, they tell you the age of their children, because the MPA is supposed to be made up of parents. It's parents, you know, looking at a film and rating it for other parents. And the average age of the child that these people have, 22, 25. I mean, you know, it's like these people have kids, technically, but kids who are long since passed, mm-hmm. you know, the stage where the parent has to worry about, like, is it okay for them to see Dave Chappelle's Block Party? You know, it's just it's a silly, really silly process. And one that's not governed by anybody.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like beholden to the FCC or something like that. You know,
pays them?
They're paid. It's a government body, but they're not voted into office. They're all just pretty much handpicked and hired for a long time by like.
And they tell you who picks them and everything.
This dude for ages. This dude Jack Valenti, since the MPA was started, was this old dude who had like government ties and whatnot. I mean, he was handpicked by, I think it was, if I remember the doc correctly, Nixon, pre-Nixon? I forget.
Wow.
So, great documentary. This film is not yet rated, it's called.
Why is it a secret who they are, though? Why do they want to be identified?
That's what the whole documentary is about. Like, why is it a secret? Their philosophy at the MPA is, like, they have to keep the identities on the down low because they would get lobbied by people to, you know, rate their film differently. But it's just kind of horseshit.
Yeah.
Based on that, you wouldn't know who any government official was because they could be lobbied. You know, it just makes very little sense.
Let's go to Mark in Jersey. Mark, what's up?
Hey, what's up, guys? Kevin Smith. I think you're great. I love Clerks.
Thank you, sir.
Real quick, how come you picked the shithole town of Paulsboro, New Jersey to film Jersey Girl?
It was very close to Philadelphia. It was about 15 minutes from Philadelphia, and that's where we were based with the crew and whatnot, because you have to kind of shoot in areas where you can pull from a crew base. And Philly, there's a big crew base. Shooting in Philly is cheaper than shooting in New York and shooting in Jersey, because where we live in Jersey, it's about 75 miles away from what's considered the zone. This center of Manhattan goes out about 60 to 70 miles. And once you go beyond that, you have to pay people more because they mm-hmm. have to travel further to get to where you're shooting. So by shooting in Philly, we can stay within a zone. And then Paulsboro was only like 15 minutes down the road. So that was still well within the zone. And it kind of doubled pretty well for the town of Highlands, which is like 2 hours south of there or north of there.
Did you have any issues with Clerks 2? Where you shot it, because of so much time going by, was there any?
No, I mean, so much of the Clerks 2 is set in it's in a burger joint called Movies. So we didn't have to worry about shooting in Leonardo, New Jersey, where the Quick Stop is. We went back there for like a week at the end of the show and shot there. But most of it was shot in this town in Los Angeles, Buena Park. So it didn't really have enough time, had no effect on it. I mean, the great thing about what the movie has going for it in its back pocket is that time is on its side. Like, both Brian and Jeff look older.
Yeah.
And there's something kind of poignant about that. You know, something even more sad about these dudes still working at these shitty jobs.
Yeah, I saw some. I went to a website and saw some pictures of the location then and now, and it's so odd. Like, to see a little twig of a tree growing on the side of it, and it's just this huge, massive tree now. And
the weird thing is, when people see it in color for the first time, they're like, I don't agree with the color choice of the building. It's like, it's always been that color.
Are people just stopping by that location all the time?
Yeah, they said that they get people at literally every day.
Jersey legend, man.
They buy Gatorade and smokes, and then they ask to take a picture behind the counter.
Oh, that's
and
so
they,
cool.
They hate it. The toppers who own the store are just like, oh, it's too disruptive. People come in
Screw
here all
that,
the time.
Why wouldn't you
just charge $5 to do it?
Totally. That's what I said.
What's wrong with
you? You're selling t-shirts. You got to start charging people to take a picture behind the desk. I mean, make the most of it.
Yeah,
but they're very... it's every time we go there to shoot something, like we went there to shoot this, they refuse to shut down for us to shoot. So basically, we're shooting while the store's open. So you roll, you go inside, you're rolling on a take. You say cut. They open the door. People come in, buy cigarettes and milk while you're getting ready for the next take.
Yeah.
Then you wait for everyone to leave, and then you roll again.
You think they would throw you a bone? My God.
I know, because it's not like we're doing it for free. Right. Like you have to throw them a location fee as well. Yeah. But still, they're like their philosophy is we cannot shut the store down because what if people come here to buy milk and we're locked up because you're shooting your movie and then they go to Krauser's and buy milk instead.
Right.
They don't want to. I mean, good for them because they're loyal to the customer base.
Right.
But it is kind of strange.
Come
it's
on.
Like if you give us an hour of closed store, we'll be done and out of your hair. But like that hour becomes four because you have to wait for somebody to come in, buy a pack of Skittles and leave.
That's really
you think maybe they like the idea, though, of people coming in and seeing you guys film there, too? Maybe it's a way to kind of show off that they're having a movie made there?
I don't think it has nothing to do with that, because they could, if they could, they would erase the memory of the movie from people's minds, because they feel it disrupts business all the time. Like, when people come in to take a picture of the store, like, while they're working, it's just like, that's holding that dude, holding up this dude behind them from buying a paper. So, I mean, they're very nice people, and they're kind to everyone that comes in, but, like, they secretly can't stand when people come in and say, like, this place is so much bigger than it looks in the movie. They're like, we can tell the people when they walk through the door, we can tell them right away that they're fans because their eyes are wide and they're staring at everything in the store.
It's like, I could understand about the disruption thing if, you know, you did the movie in a hospital.
Right.
But it's like, God, you're a fucking convenience store, okay?
Totally.
Lighten up.
I think maybe at the end of the day, it's just like too much traffic. They like their downtime.
Yeah.
They like to, you know, the morning rush and then the post-school rush, but like, they like that downtime. They can sit around and watch TV and stuff, but now they got people come in all the time.
Dogma, we talked about it over the phone for a little while last time we spoke. You had a lot of issues with that, with the Catholic League.
Yeah.
You know, no...
Such a great organization.
Donahue, we've had our problems with him, too. With
he the, got on you. Oh, that's
the
right,
church,
the fucking the
St. Pat's thing. And,
yeah, that dude's a tool. That dude has nothing to do with the Catholic Church whatsoever.
None.
He's self-appointed. He created his own organization.
He loves the attention.
Like you read about. And then he makes grist for the mill out of it. And then at the end of the day, like, because he took us to task for Dogma and raked us over the coals and whatnot. And then some Entertainment Weekly reporter who had spoken to him passed on to me, like, once the Dogma thing died down, she said, Bill Donahue said he would love to take you out and buy you a beer.
Yeah.
And I was just like, first off, I don't drink. Second off, like, this dude made my life hell for months.
Yeah.
And what's the Catholic dude doing drinking?
He said,
you know, like, I'm bad. I'm going to hell because I made this movie and this dude wants to booze it up.
Yeah. Would you ever take on something like that that you know would give you some shit in your life
it'd
at this
tough.
Point in
it'd,
your life?
It'd
you
be
know?
Tough. Like,
when
I,
you're full
I,
of piss and vinegar as a kid, it's like, you know, I'm going to fight a man.
It would be tough at this point because I've thought about doing a follow-up to Dogma, not necessarily Dogma 2, but something in the same vein. Particularly after September 11th, like, religion became a big topic of discussion. I mean, you know, September 11th is religiously motivated. Our president admits to being a born-again Christian. You know, creepy religious things going on where I was just like, wow, I do have a lot more to say about religion. But now I'm married and I got a kid. And the thing is, if you're going to talk about religion, you have to talk about Islam at this point.
Yep.
And the moment you talk about Islam, you know,
you got to worry about your head.
You got to worry about fucking getting killed.
Yep.
And I was single and by myself, I was irresponsible. Who gives a shit?
I got my friends. Will kick their ass.
It's just like Brian Johnson, Walt Flanagan, at Halfstack. We'll take them all on.
Kick their ass.
Take on the entire fucking community.
And now you got to think of a wife and
I got a wife and kid, and that's the thing. It becomes, and people be like, "Oh, you pussy." It's like, all right, you go do it. You know, just take my place.
Never understand
at least
that.
You're honest though about being, because they are, to me, Islam is scary and they murder you for speech issues,
right?
And nobody wants to talk about that. Everybody's like, well, you know, you can't be judgmental. I mean, they're peaceful. They're not peaceful. That's not Kevin saying, that's me saying. They're not peaceful people.
Yeah, no, it's not about, like, I'm being kind to people and letting them have their say. It's just like, if you, I mean, look at what's going on with the Danish folks who drew the cartoons in the newspaper. It's like, that is some frightening shit.
How about Van Gogh, who did an unpopular film about Islam, so the guy stabs him, shoots him, and sits on his chest and waits for the cops. They're sociopaths.
Yeah. But it's not violent.
I'm back and forth with an email thing with a guy who's not a bad guy, but he's like, you're a Muslim hater, and I got to deal with that shit. And it's like, no, I'm not. kind of.
Three keys on the keyboard, the Y, the E, and the yes. The Jimmy, send.
And that's the thing, it's like they'll make it like about hating Muslims, and it's not about hating Muslims, it's about hating any extremist, anybody, yeah. a Catholic, a Christian extremist, anybody who takes it too fucking far.
Well, when Christians all over the world are fucking rioting and setting fires because of something Marmaduke did, then I'll lump them all into the same category. But right now, Islam, this one is on you.
Don't you remember the great Garfield uprising from 78?
Yeah.
Where people were like, he likes lasagna far too much, and somehow this besmirches Christ.
All right, well, let's go to the phones. A lot of people want to talk to Kevin Smith this morning. Heather, what's up?
Hey, Kevin Smith, how are you?
Hey, how are you?
Good. I wanted to tell you I love Clerks.
Thank you.
Ironically, I moved to Jersey. I moved to Middletown about 5 years ago, so I've been to the Quickie Mart a few times. But I wanted to know if the food circus clown made it into the second Clerks, because I saw you taping there.
We did. Food circus clown is totally in the opening, like, 5 minutes of the movie. There's this big, there used to be a food store in Middletown, New Jersey, that, you know, back in the days they would do that huge pop art, and they had this scary-looking fucking clown. You know, it's about 30 feet high and about 10, 15 feet wide, that hung out in front of this food store, food circus it was called, and it would rotate. And then eventually the town got it to stop rotating because it was too distracting because it's on a main highway. Then the place sold, closed down, the food circus closed down and became a liquor world instead. So now he's like the liquor clown with these red eyes and whatnot. And he's got an oddly placed hand there. There used to be a secondary piece of art that came out, him holding a balloon, but the balloon's gone. It looks like he's holding his cock. So it's this thing, this total, like, wonderful eyesore that sits on the highway in Middletown that people have been trying to get taken down for years, and a bunch of people, the rest of us, have supported it because it's such a great, like, piece of pop culture that you don't see anymore. They don't really do big art. Now it's all billboards whoring something, right? Mm-hmm. It's corporate shit. But this is this great piece of fucking, like, bizarre advertising art that you just don't really see anymore, like the giant Alfred E. Newmans that sit in front of, like, Great Adventure and shit like that.
Yeah.
So we've been trying to put that in a movie for so many years, and finally got it into Clerks 2. We were shot, and that's what she was asking about.
All right, let's say hi to Vince in Chicago. Hey, Vince.
Hey, good morning, boys.
What's up?
Good morning, Jimmy.
Hello, Vince.
Hey, Kevin.
Hey, good morning. How are you?
Are you wearing your FUBU today?
I'm not wearing FUBU now. I used to wear FUBU shirts all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then I found a dude who can make me a close approximation of a FUBU shooter so I could put my own shit on it. Because I used to get really bad looks from some black folks.
Really?
Like, why are you wearing FUBU? I'm like, because it fits.
You know what the U means in that,
yeah,
sir?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Hey, I saw Clerks on, I don't know, cable over the weekend. And it reminded me, the last time you were on the show, did you say there's an alternate ending to that?
Yeah, if you check out the Clerks DVD, there's an alternate ending where Dante gets shot. The guy who works in the convenience store gets shot and killed.
Yeah, it's just an awful, depressing ending for that movie.
What a
real good
idea.
Such a fun, good-spirited movie. And then there he is just laying there dead on the floor.
Totally not a good idea.
Horrible.
But the first idea I ever had about the script, I was just like, I want to make a movie about working in a convenience store. At the end of it, the guy gets killed. And when I put the movie together, showed it to somebody. My friend John Pearson was just like, you got to cut that ending.
Yeah, that's
he's going to make no sense. You grow to love these characters over 90 minutes, and then you kill the guy for no other reason other than you don't know how to end the movie. I was like, yeah, I guess you're right.
Let's go to Jeff in Canada. Jeff, what's up?
Hey, how's it going? Kevin, I was at your Q&A in Vancouver in the summer.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, that was awesome. Now, you went, like, all night. I think they basically shut the place down while you were still talking.
That was about, I think we wound up going, like, 6.5 hours that night.
Yeah,
the DVDs are great, man.
Thank you.
Where Kevin goes around various colleges and locations and just takes Q&A, and they're funny and entertaining and informative.
I love doing Q&A.
It's obvious you like doing it.
Oh, yeah.
Hi, Jeff.
You got a second volume of those coming out, right?
Yeah, Evening with Kevin Smith 2, Evening Harder, comes out in August.
It was pretty cool because when we left that night, we saw Jason Mewes leaving with two chicks. That was pretty cool.
Yeah, he's the Jason Mewes is just a fucking pussy magnet.
Yeah, I saw him at a party one night, and he was just, you know, working the room.
Oh, it's insane. And now that he's sober, because, you know, he was just a fucking really bad junkie for a while.
Yeah.
He was on heroin and OxyContin. But in April, it'll be 3 years completely clean and sober for him. Now he just gets insanely more pussy. Like, don't matter. Like, Jason gets really bad cold sores and shit. You know, I get cold sores too, but Jason will get cold sores like three at a time across his lips, look like fucking Rocky Balboa. Like, you know, after a few rounds. Like, big, nasty ones, like, unavoidable. You can tell what they are. It's not like, oh, he's got chapped lips. You're like, those are fucking cold sores. And the dude will still get fucked with the cold sores.
Jesus Christ.
One of those dudes doesn't even have to try.
Let's go to.
Is it easy? You would assume it's easier to work with him these days,
much,
sober.
Oh, much easier. I mean, the
But I'm thinking the other way. Maybe now he's a prima donna, and you know.
No, not at all. The truth was, though, every time we've ever shot a movie, he's never really been using or drunk or anything like that. Mm-hmm. It's as soon as we stop shooting, left to his own devices, when he doesn't have something to occupy all his time. That's what he would occupy his time with, fucking
yeah.
drugs. Now it's poker and fucking this Lord of the Rings online game that he plays. I mean, you know, you drop one addiction, you got to replace it with another.
Yep,
and
yep.
he's replaced it with fucking Lord of the Rings, that, which is how they ought to really market or advertise that game. It's just like, if you're a junkie and you want to get clean, you know, storm the castles of Mordor and shit like that.
Here's
like
no addiction.
Those games are just yeah. like crack, though.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, so
I was on EverQuest for years where
Evercrack.
Where you were able to look and see how much real time you've actually played.
Right.
Not how long you
cumulative.
Since you subscribed. Yeah, how long you've actually been playing the game. And mine had reached over 365 days.
Could
a
you
year.
Imagine?
And it's like, there was a year of my life spent
playing
this fucking game, man.
Right.
It's amazing. It's just this whole thing. It is. If you have anything of an addictive personality, those games are built for it.
Oh, totally.
It's like, I got to get to the next level. And then once you get there, it's like, I got to get to the
and
next level.
And is it a game with an ending, or does it just
it's
keep
no,
going?
No, it's open-ended. They keep giving you expansion packs, so it adds new material, and then you got to keep going, and then you could peek out at like level 60, and then you do that, and all of a sudden, hey, we're opening up to 75 people, level
right.
75. Now you got to be level 75. You're fucking pussy, getting your ass level 60.
Never
it just
ends.
Doesn't end.
That's tremendous.
Actually, what's his name? His son was addicted to it. Ben Stein.
Oh, Ben Stein. That's right.
Ben
yeah.
Stein wrote a whole thing about how his son was addicted to EverQuest. Serious, man. Took him to rehab. Had to sit in there. Woke up at 2 a.m. to find him crying on the computer as his father was dragging him off and stuff. And I just picturing the scene. Could you please get off the computer? Like, I can't picture him being angry or anything. But had to send him to rehab for video games.
Unbelievable.
Really sad.
Let's say hi to Mike in New Jersey.
How
Mike?
Embarrassing to be in rehab. And what are you here for? Video
yeah.
games.
EverQuest.
This guy with track marks
yeah,
up
right?
his arms. Like no
dude's
septum
got, like,
left
carpal
in his
tunnel
nose.
Syndrome yeah. like you read about. Just his hands are claws.
Hey, Mike.
Hey, Kevin. What's up? I'm a big fan.
Hey, good morning. Thank you.
Hey, I was wondering how involved you are in the independent film festivals. I know you've sponsored Freedom Film Festival in Red Bank, and I was wondering if, you know, you're still involved in them and everything.
I don't want to take credit for that festival. I didn't. They asked me to throw some money behind it, and I think I bought some ads and threw them some cash or something. But that was a festival of their own doing. Those cats that put that together in Red Bank. But I don't get that involved. I mean, I'll be involved in a fest if I take a movie there or if I go there to be a judge or something like that. But I haven't. The only festival that I've sponsored, and it was more of an online festival, was this Movies Askew contest we did last year, where people could send in their flicks and other people can vote on them and stuff mm-hmm. like that. But I'm just not talented enough to pull off a film festival myself. I mean, we've done these things called Bulgarthons, where we'll like rent out in Los Angeles. We rented out the Cinerama Dome for a day and showed like 4 or 5 of our movies and stuff. But that's kind of that to me is a one day event, and it's not as involved as a Sundance or something like that, or even as that Freedom Fest in Red Bank, because it takes a lot to traffic a bunch of prints and find a bunch of movies to show from various mm-hmm. distributors. If I want to show a bunch of stuff I've done or some friends of mine have done, very easy.
You must get solicited a lot from people like, "Hey, dude, I got a great idea. You got $60,000 I could use."
Yeah, it's just kind of a bummer because
yeah.
you just sit there going like, "Hey, man, like I never did that myself." You know, because the thing that hits you with is like, I am where you were once.
Right.
You were me once. And it's like, I was never you because I never asked anybody for anything.
Yeah.
You know, I put it on my fucking credit cards and shit like that. So
go into debt, you idiot.
Yeah, exactly. It's just like, I can't help you out, man. Or I could, but like, why would I? Like, I'd rather help out my friends who want to make a movie. People
yeah.
I've known
yeah.
for fucking years, not total strangers.
Hey, what was your favorite movie of the year, Kevin?
Last year?
Yeah.
I mean,
Oscar's right around the corner here.
I think I did a list online. I think it was War of the Worlds. I loved War of the Worlds.
I still haven't seen War of the Worlds.
I could watch that movie again and again and again. I mean, it has like the kind of bullshit ending where
the reviews were kind of shaky on that when it came out. Not that we should like follow every review.
Totally.
But...
I mean, and I could see where some of the complaints were. I thought it was fucking gripping.
Visually,
like, the best time
great,
I had in a movie theater.
You know what? I'm gonna go home and watch that tonight now because it's on my on demand. I'm like, I'm looking for a movie every week, and I always pass and say, I just don't want to see War of the Worlds.
It's good. Like it's really like he Spielberg sets up a mood, man, and that keeps that tension going throughout the fucking flick.
Yeah. What were some of the other movies you liked?
I liked Brokeback quite a bit. Did you see it?
No. Yeah, I saw it.
I thought it was like incredibly poignant.
That's what I did. I came in and I'm like, of course, jumping in the barrel with these motherfuckers. And I said, I liked it.
Yeah.
It was good. It's a love story.
It's very much a love story.
But,
it's also,
you know, it's two guys.
Two
all right.
Dudes.
There's an issue there. There is a couple of points where, as a guy, you're just watching and you go, ah, oh, Jesus.
Right.
You know,
the moment where he spits in his fucking palm and rubs it in his cock and just grills the dude from behind, just drills him hard.
The tense scene.
You know, you got to sit
if
there and go, like,
say
all right.
Love, I don't know.
The throw, when he
I don't know what
when,
does.
You know what? And we were even talking about how, all right, you know, two guys, ass sex in the tent, you
right.
know, savage sex is one thing. It was that. More disturbing was the thrown against the wall kissing.
Yes.
It's like, that's so...
That was kind of...
You know,
that's,
just,
and also,
that's,
there's a scene in the movie like where he throws him against the wall and they start making out where he hasn't seen him in a few years.
Yeah, yeah.
And meanwhile, like, his wife is like 10 feet away.
The look
within,
on her face.
Within eyesight. Like, there's just... They throw caution to the wind and they're making out in the middle of this community that would fucking drag them behind truck if they could. And that was the one moment where I was like, all right, I get it. The idea is like these two dudes are so passionate about one another.
Mm-hmm.
They would throw caution to the wind. But it's like... If they'd moved 5 feet to the left, they would have been hidden. Nobody would have seen them. There's no threat whatsoever.
Get under the stairs.
It's like I'm all for passion, but logic has to factor in there somewhere. But I thought it was a really wonderful movie about the road not taken more than anything
mm-hmm.
else. Like how some people will fucking live their lives not doing what they want to do or trying to do what they want to do because of a societal norm or just because, oh, it could never work out, like just shitting on their own dreams.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me is where it really worked and where it's kind of poignant and whatnot. I mean, a lot of people like it's the gay cowboy movie. There is about a minute and 30 seconds of gayness in that whole movie.
Should have been longer.
Yeah.
That was some hot gayness.
I wouldn't mind being fucked in the ass. Just don't cup my chin and look me in the eyes. That's what would creep me out.
There is a lot of longing looks and whatnot.
The oddest thing with that movie was the first sex scene where the guy's in the tent, the other guy's cold in the sleeping bag outside.
Did you feel it was kind of abrupt?
In, and it was like, wait a minute, you know, now they're fucking.
Yeah,
it did kind of come
out of nowhere, and it wasn't like some people have gone back and forth with it about me going like, no, you could see them laying the seeds and whatnot.
You could kind of see
not
a little,
so, it's
but
not like
that
there was
much.
A shot like where one dude like there was a shot where one of them had her shirt off. And the other dude was washing up. But it wasn't like the other dude was looking at the other dude with the shirt off. And you kind of get the sense of like, wow, I think he might like that dude with the shirt off. It was like they were in a tent and they were kind of cold. And one dude pulls the arm of the other dude over him.
Yeah.
And then it was Jake Gyllenhaal pulls Heath Ledger's arm over. And then Heath Ledger wakes up and reacts poorly to it.
Yeah.
And then Jake Gyllenhaal starts kissing him. And then Heath Ledger literally spits in his fucking palm. Rubs in his cock, pulls his pants down and starts fucking him. And you're like, "Is that all it takes?" I've been very close to dudes over my life. I've slept in the same bed with Muse. Who knew that fucking if I had my arm over him, fucking he'd wake up and spit in his fucking palm.
5 degrees colder, you wouldn't.
That's it. Thank God the heat was on.
Yeah, I thought that was
but really well made
good,
movie.
Good movie.
Really
looked
totally.
Great.
Will it win
fantastic.
All the awards, you think?
I think it's going to win Best Picture. Foregone conclusion it wins Best Picture.
Yeah.
Sadly, I don't think Heath Ledger is going to win Best Actor. I think Philip Seymour Hoffman
will take it. He was amazing and Truman Capote.
He was great and all props to him. I think he's a fucking brilliant actor.
He was a little long.
But at the same time, like it's the Jamie Foxx, Ray Charles thing. Like, I give it up to him for pulling off Truman Capote, but at the same time, it's an impression.
Thank you.
Like, you might as well.
Holy shit.
Why not?
First time someone's agreeing with me here.
And I am not taking anything away from him. He did a great job. But between
mm-hmm.
him and Heath Ledger, like, Heath Ledger created a character, and who knew fucking Heath Ledger could act?
Yeah.
He was amazing in that movie. Like, you stop thinking about him as being Heath Ledger, and you're like, this is a dude that fucking exists. One of those quiet, fucking sad people that you've come across in your life and shit. Friends of your parents and whatnot. Dudes who apparently wanted to fuck your dad. Now you find out why they're so quiet. But that dude really, like, created a character from scratch. You know, so much mm-hmm. so that you get lost and you forget who he is. Philip Seymour Hoffman, while great in Capote, is basically had shit to go from. He knows what Truman Capote sounds like. You can go back and listen to recordings. You can watch him in that movie Murder by Death. And to me, it's like, well, why not give fucking Rich Little an Oscar, you know?
Yeah, Rich Little on Carson doing
exactly,
Capote.
Exactly.
Isn't that also the same thing that could sink you, though? Like the fact that everybody can kind of go to this guy and say that, so it's like as great, as easy as it makes it for you to do it, mm-hmm. it also makes it that much harder because people can go make a relative comparison and go, eh, no.
I would agree, but at the same time, you're not talking about somebody who the whole world knows. You know, like Truman Capote, you really have to be kind of well versed in the field of literature or arcane fucking pop culture to understand to know what who Truman Capote mm-hmm. was and what he sounded like. It'd be one thing if like he was playing fucking George Bush, you know, and everybody goes, well, all right, we all know what this dude sounds like. Right. A lot of people don't necessarily know what Capote sounds like. But you're right. If he didn't pull it off, it could have been horrible. But at the same time, he's not playing a guy where if he didn't pull it off, the whole world would be like, you fucking ruined Truman Capote. Yeah. You know, you got most of the world going, who the fuck was Truman Capote? Capote,
right? Dude, I think if you're going to give an Oscar for best actor, mm-hmm. it should be
a performance.
Based on a performance of somebody, yeah, like you said, hey, this guy created a character
totally.
From nowhere, and it's so believable. And this guy's doing a great impression
yeah.
of Truman
and
Capote.
It was a sublime impression. Like, boy, he really fucking... If you watch that movie Murder by Death, and then you watch Capote, you're like, that guy fucking nailed it. He is more Truman than fucking Truman was himself.
I think he should have gotten an Oscar for Boogie Nights.
Yeah,
that
totally.
Was Scotty, a fantastic yes. character.
And there's
man.
A character, totally created character.
Oh, yeah.
You bought that. You forgot that dude was an actor. And you're like, even when he's holding the board with two hands and he's holding a pen in his mouth,
yes.
you're like, that fucking dude exists.
My favorite scene in that is when he's trying to hold the boom mic and the sex starts and he's like... He can't even fucking breathe. Right. It's hysterical.
You know what's great? I saw Mission Impossible 3. J.J. Abrams showed me
you
an early
bastard.
Cut of the movie. It is fucking awesome. But
is it?
Philip Seymour Hoffman plays the most sinister, crimson, believable screen villain you've ever fucking
seen
in your life.
Yeah.
Like the scariest screen villain since like Hannibal Lecter in Silence of the Lambs, where you're like, this
wow.
dude is fucking scary. And not scary like, you know, they show you villains all the time where it's like, I'm going to kill you. And it's not that scary. You know, that most
well,
of them
especially
were...
if they deliver it like that.
Exactly.
I'm going to kill you.
That's the performance.
Especially after 9/11, now every terrorist they show in a movie is still German.
Yes.
Or Russian
Euro yeah. trash.
That's fucking not realistic.
Yeah. Hans Gruber. Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
Right. I am Christian. We know. We understand. We know.
But this dude pulls. He's Philip Seymour Hoffman is so fucking disturbing in the movie. Like if you've seen that trailer online where he's uh-huh. going, like, do you have a girlfriend? Like, what's even more impressive about that scene is he's in that scene. He is in the submissive position. Like he's been captured at this point, and he's still fucking like just sitting there talking to Cruise, going, "I'm gonna hurt her. I'm going to hurt
yeah.
her, and then I'm going to kill you in front of her." And you buy it. He's so fucking good in the movie. You got to see it. It's a tremendous flick.
I saw, you know, I was watching last night, and I couldn't get enough of it. I fucking Grizzly Man was on.
Oh, you watched that?
I told
you.
Dude.
I told you.
I didn't see the whole thing because I had to get to bed for this. I saw like an hour and a half of it or an hour and 20 minutes of it. I really liked that guy. He was a bit of an ass, but I wound up liking Timothy Treadwell.
Oh, you did?
Dude, I liked him. I really liked Tim Treadwell. I was like so happy that he got
eaten. So did a bear.
Liked him a lot.
I wound up enjoying
that
the movie.
That guy decided
great.
To commit suicide, man.
I liked him a lot, man.
You can't
you
do that.
You didn't see the end of the movie yet?
You
not
can't
yet, no.
sit there and cavort with bears and not expect to get fucking eaten.
Oh, he was a
later.
Douche, but
what
I mean, I just kind of felt for
yeah.
him at one point.
But did you read the story yeah. about those two bears they just euthanized? There's two bears who I guess they had them in some kind of zoo-like preserve or something like that. And this four-year-old got through three different barriers. Aided and abetted by his parents, apparently, to take a picture as close to a bear as possible.
Holy
didn't get
shit.
Mauled by the bear, got kind of scratched or hit by the bear, and it's a question
takes.
As to whether or not it was, whether he was actually hit or scratched by the actual bear. But there was the place that, I don't know if it's a zoo or a preserve or something, immediately opted to euthanize the bears
that's
and then check them
takes.
For rabies.
That amazing.
And now the town's in an uproar because they didn't clear it with the town, and the town is maintaining, like, look, this is on our property. So you had to confer with us first, and you didn't. Now there's a massive investigation. But you sit there going, what kind of asshole parent gets their
yep.
kid through two fucking barriers to get close to a wild animal?
Did the kid die or just get hurt?
No, kid didn't hurt. Kid barely got hurt.
But now
like, it's not like he was
the
in
bears.
The hospital, but they put the bears down.
I hate that shit.
Yeah.
Like when someone gets too close at a zoo and they grab the coat and yank you into the...
And they're like, we got to kill it. They got a taste for human blood.
Yeah. Because the animal is doing what it's supposed to do.
Totally.
You ever see the polar bear one where he's ripping at the lady's
right.
coat? Oh, that's the greatest footage
But they
ended
up killing the polar bear.
because the lady was stupid enough to be, you know, that close.
A couple of years ago, about a year or two ago in Jersey, like right by Six Flags by Great Adventure, I guess there was a lady that had some wild animals who I guess used to be.
Yes,
and she had a tiger, and a tiger got out. And for the first day, she was kind of going like, "What? I don't have any tiger." Like, everyone knew her as the tiger lady.
Yeah, like,
but you know, she didn't want to cop to it because it's illegal to have a fucking wild animal.
Of course.
So they captured the tiger and they put the fucking tiger. The tiger did nothing. Strolled around, didn't attack anybody and shit. And then they still chose to euthanize.
You think they could just dump them somewhere where they belong in India? Or
apparently,
something,
in this lady's yard. Yeah, that's where it was, but just got out one day.
Or a zoo or something. Let it just hang out. Fucking. I don't know. I don't
it's
like
weird.
Hunting.
Take shit out of its natural element and you know, and then decide to kill it. They do the same thing with sharks, though. Shark attacks, they go nuts. They're like, we got to kill it. And it's like, dude, you are throwing yourself in harm's way. You step into that ocean.
It's an eating machine.
That's totally. That's like the story of every summer, you know. If it's a slow news week, they focus on the shark attacks and it's
remember 2001, like right before September 11th hit? There was that whole, that was the summer of shark attacks, and you could not open up a paper without reading about it and shit, and then September 11th happened, and people were like, fuck the sharks.
Yeah.
We got to worry about people again.
We got something real to talk about,
exactly.
Finally.
We went through some stats here on the show. We did our own research about shark attacks and deaths related to shark attacks, and it turned out more people were killed by vending machines falling on them.
Get out of here.
Than shark attacks.
Every year, yeah.
And not a sexy story, the vending machine falling on
you. No, like you're just going crazy trying to get that, and it falls over and kills you. More dangerous than sharks.
Yeah, it wouldn't be a good movie, Robert Shaw and Scheider attacking a vending machine. Give me my change, you son of a bitch.
Talking about the vending machine on the Indianapolis. You know, anyway, we delivered the bomb. There was
I'll never try to buy a Hershey bar again.
A great DVD I watched. Last year is called Anatomy of a Shark Bite. Did you ever see it?
Mm-mm.
It was like a Discovery Channel special, I think. And it was people.
Oh,
talking.
Is that the guy with the pressure sensitive equipment?
Yeah, they created that part of the show was kind of bullshit where they're like, we're going to have a team of experts create a shark and show you what it would look like, you know. And they had these mechanics, like movie mechanics, mm-hmm. people that work on special effects and scientists all recreating the bite radius and the pressure and shit like that. That part was just such a waste of money. But they had interviews with people who survived attacks and fucking footage. And they have this one piece of footage of this girl. In the water, falling off this fucking boat. She was a cook on not so much a cruise ship, but kind of like a day cruise ship or something like that. Not like a Pacific Princess, like Love Boat kind of thing, but something that goes out for a day. It's got like 50 people on it. And so there's two boats in the water, that one and another boat of like a smaller vessel, holds about 10 people, and they go out and cruise this area. I think it was in Australia. Chick fell off the boat. She's swimming toward and it's somebody on a third boat with a fucking camera who's just like, hey, this chick fell in the water. I'm going to shoot this footage. And all of a sudden, you see her. She's coming back to the fucking boat. This fucking just shadow come up from under her.
Oh, man.
And fucking take her right down. And the screaming, and then suddenly the camera work starts herky-jerking around. You see blood in the water. She bobs down. She gets back up. These dudes throw a pole at her. She's grabbing onto the pole. They're all struggling to get to her. And you see the fucking fin flapping back and forth. And then they yank her out of the water, and you just see her leg get left behind, like from the hip all the way down.
Holy
it was fucking
shit.
Frightening. And you're sitting there going, this is the best piece of footage I've ever seen in my
ever.
Life. Like, thank God somebody had a camera. So bad for her. And then they interview her, and she's alive. She lived through it, but she's missing her leg from the hip down, her right or left leg, I forget which one. And so they're sitting there talking to her about it, and, you know, it's years later, so she's pretty calm about it. She's happy to have her life and shit. But you know it's got to eat at her in
every
some place.
Day.
Like, you survived it, but, like, you think about it, like, something fucking ate you and then shit you out. You know, it was like, and that was it. Like, what an insult that is.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like it took your life. It ate your fucking leg, shit it out, never thought about you again.
Didn't even think
like,
about it.
For you, that is a defining moment in your life. And for that fucking beast, it was just like yeah, I ate something once. I don't know.
Reach over and grab a french fry and
throw
it in your mouth.
Totally.
Didn't even enjoy your leg.
Exactly.
A sneaker.
Yeah, probably didn't like it.
It was too much pressure, you know, everyone watching and shit like that. Didn't get a full meal, but it's so weird, the notion of something eating you and then just crapping you out and that's it. And that'll affect you for the rest of your fucking life.
I think the fact that she's alive makes it
a little better. Like, think of those people that get lost and eaten and just completely eaten, gone. Right. You never existed. You're just gone.
And they get shit out. That's the weird part to me. It's like the shitting out part. Like, you were just some part of somebody's fucking food chain.
That's it. You gave them a little energy to last another day,
man. You mattered to them for like 16 hours. That's it.
A little protein.
There was one point where you were touching your kid's head and educating him, and next thing you were a log floating in the Pacific.
Let's go to Kent, the movie guy. Kent, what's going on?
Hey, what's going on, boys? I just get home, turn it on, and Kevin Smith, my fucking god, is on the radio.
Sir, how are you?
Oh, my God. You are my hero.
Oh, thank you, man.
Yes.
You get a lot of this, do you, Kevin? People don't know what to say to you.
A little bit, enough where you sit there going, I feel okay.
You're very recognizable is what it is.
Yeah, because I've been in the flicks.
Yeah, you've been in the movies, so everywhere you go, you get people coming up to you.
Yeah, it's not like I've been out in the world with Affleck, and that's just, I don't understand how somebody could live like
that. It's a whole nother
level. Oh, it's fucking insane. But like me, I can go to a food store, and every once in a while I got people going, you look like Silent Bob. I'm like, yeah, I get that a lot.
Yeah, thanks.
But like if I go to something like a comic book show, like we went to the comic book show this weekend, that's when I'm like Affleck and shit. You know? Get my dick sucked by anybody in that room. but it's really very, it's so manageable. It's so, and every once in a while I get people who are like, oh, you're awesome. And you know, thanks.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's totally cool.
So sorry, you still on the line?
Yes. Right,
well, you're on the phone.
I'm just in awe.
What do you want to say to Kevin? You got him here now. Your hero is here. What would you like to say to him? He's meant a lot to you. He's right here.
Your work. It is the reason I make films myself.
Awesome,
films,
sir.
With all my friends.
I totally appreciate that.
Oh, you're just amazing, amazing. But
how about a question, Ken?
What's the deal with Green Hornet at this point?
Green Hornet, I was attached to write and direct about last year, 2 years ago now.
And I've
bowed out of directing because I realized that I'm just not talented enough to pull off an action flick. No way.
Oh, shut up.
It's true. I'm not an action movie guy. I like movies where people talk and stuff, and I was just like, I can't do this. So I wound up just writing it and bowed out of directing it.
But you fought Mark Hamill.
I did, but you know, it's not like people are like, man, that's a gripping action scene. People are like, oh, Mark, you had Luke Skywalker play Cockknocker. Like, that's what they remember about it, not how it was shot.
Wait,
because of your own self-criticism, a lot of times, whenever me and my girlfriend are watching one of your movies, we go, ooh, camera move.
Right, exactly.
Look at he's moving it.
The
man.
Next movie, the Clerks 2 is actually, like, pretty visually accomplished.
Yeah.
Like, we were really happy with it. It's kind of, camera's always moving. There's a definite... There was thought behind what we did this time around, not just like, let's just shoot people talking, it'll be fine.
Right.
There's actually some thought behind it, but still not enough I'm not in that mindset yet to get out there and try to make an action movie.
Just now, was the Green Hornet script, are you just being polite because the Green Hornet script was awful and you didn't want to do it? Or
No. It was, well, I had to write it, so it could very well be awful.
I didn't know you were wrong, so it's obviously okay.
It could totally be awful, but I wound up writing, I was going to write and direct it, but I wound up just writing it and somebody else, I presume, will direct it somewhere down the road or make their own version. They've had such a hard time making this Green Hornet movie. It was in development at Universal for at least 7 to 10 years before I got involved with it at Miramax, and now it's gone from Miramax. They can't seem to get it made, and I think that has a lot to do with the fact that there's a familiarity with the Green Hornet because of Bruce Lee, but there's no built-in audience. You know, it's not like people are going like, it's not like you have the identity factor of a Spider-Man or an X-Men. A lot of people, you know, people who know Green Hornet are people that don't go to the movies anymore because they're like, oh, those fucking whippersnappers. You know, they're like 7 years old and shit.
But it kind of worked for Batman because people were very familiar with that franchise. And then the last one that came out was fantastic, I thought.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely. But also Batman, like you would have to be Batman is part of the pop cultural mainstream, like so iconic. Like when they first launched that series of flicks in 89, they had ages of familiarity with the character from not just the TV show, but fucking the cartoons. Like, everyone knows Batman.
Right.
You don't even have to know comic books to know Batman. Green Hornet, not so much.
Mm-hmm.
Walk into a supermarket, ask 100 people, do you know what Green Hornet is? And most people would be like, floor cleaner? You know? I don't think you get a lot of people going, oh, yeah, there's a radio show that they turned into a TV show with Van Williams, Bruce Lee, and... They've done as a series, small series of comic book. You know, I don't think a lot of people have that built-in familiarity.
I bet everybody knew at the Comic-Con, though.
Totally. That place? Yeah. Absolutely. But that's why, like, comic book movies are for a long time, people were kind of daunted by the idea of making them because Now they've figured out a way to do it where it's like retell the origin story and go mainstream with it and lose some of the cool things about a comic book character that you do like so that you can get out there into the mainstream. Because if you think about it, like the best-selling comic book on every given week is what? Let's say the average right now is 100,000 books.
Yeah.
100,000 people go out to see a movie on opening weekend, pay $10. How much is that, $1 million? Mm-hmm. You've spent 70, 80 to make a movie? That's not great.
How about the Fantastic Four? Didn't that not do well?
No, Fantastic Four did pretty well, It actually wound up doing well, which is amazing because that movie
was such a piece of shit.
Piece of dog shit.
Yeah, I keep seeing it on cable and I won't even, like...
I won't touch
it. I don't have
so
any real ambition.
I mean, it was such a... imagine, like, trying to follow The Incredibles, which was, like, Fantastic Four done right, and then they did that movie and... just so not good. Like the ending battle sequence, there, Dr. Doom comes out of a garbage truck at one point. Yeah. Like, there's no grandeur to it whatsoever.
And they're making a sequel.
Yeah. Well, it made a lot of money. It made, what, 160, 170 something, or something?
60, yeah.
I didn't see it. I mean, after all my work on Spider-Man, I just decided I didn't comic book.
You are looking at Surly Truck Driver from Spider-Man.
Like, he doesn't know that.
What part of Spider-Man?
There was like a bunch of man on the street stuff.
Right.
And I was the critical turning point film where I said, he stinks and I don't like him.
Where's the clip?
You were that dude?
That was me.
Right on, man. How was that?
Jimmy.
Well, it's been a lot of pressure to kind of follow that up in my career.
The bar set so high first time out.
Here he is.
Here it is. This is his actual line from Spider-Man.
Here he is.
He stinks, and I don't like him.
There you go. What do you think, Kevin?
That's pretty.
He's
you
got
know
talent,
what?
Right?
Sir, you are the next Ben Affleck.
Yeah, but you should have seen the look. You know, I mean, I looked. I wasn't just standing there. I was loading.
I remember that part of the movie.
And
now,
you were surly. Which is the most important part of a surly truck.
And there was
driver.
A truck there. I mean, the whole thing was.
How did it all come together? How'd you wind up doing that?
Oh, it's funny. My manager at the time asked me if I wanted to audition for Spider-Man. I'm like, no. I had no idea. Like, I would get it. So I'm like low self-esteem. I'm like, I'm not going to audition. Right. So I went out and they had the improv dialogue. So I just trashed Spider-Man and the socks and all that shit. So they put me on the street. I got it. And it was all second unit. I didn't get to meet Raimi. And 45 minutes of just talking.
Right.
I did a few, like, you know, load jokes. And they're like, this is for kids.
Right.
Not do that. Just fucking, like, you know, web jerk-off references. And that was just the one line they left in. It was a miracle I even got left in the
So did you know when the movie was coming out that you were going to be in it? Or were
no.
you sitting there watching it going, I'm in this fucking movie.
I'm in a blockbuster. Jesus.
This is amazing.
I had moved by that point from Jersey to New York. So the invitation to the premiere I get, like, months later when my mail was forwarded. But I found out, like, when the listeners called in that day, we were on NEW. And they were like, dude, you made the flick. And they somebody... played the clip that day. That's how I found out I was actually
forgot about that. You're right.
What a delightful surprise. That must have made your week or like the next two fucking weeks.
I
call up everyone you know going, go fucking see Spider-Man.
I still get checks for that. I mean, it was like a grand for one day. It was a great pay.
Totally.
And I still get checks because that movie has made so much, like $35, $50 checks, but it's like when it goes on a DVD or
$35, $50, but you were in the movie for about maybe 10 seconds.
Possibly. And my
imagine the checks
that
fucking,
happy.
What's his name gets? Tobey Maguire.
Oh, dude, he probably made 50, 80 grand off that film.
Could be a couple of more dollars than that, Jimmy. Sure. Let's go to Nate in Utah. Nate, what's up today?
What's happening, guys?
Hey, man.
All I want to say is, Kevin, thank you for lots and lots of laughs, man.
Oh, right on. Thank you, sir.
That's it?
Yep, that's it.
All right. So, Muse in the Clerks 2?
Muse is in the Clerks 2 as well. He comes in, and we have it, but Jay and Silent Bob have about as much screen time as we had in the first Clerks.
The first one, yeah.
It's really like Dante and Randall's movie.
Yeah.
Rosario Dawson's
the
movie.
One.
So fucking gorgeous, so talented. Really like charming actress.
I've watched Clerks, the original, so many goddamn times, and then the DVD. You've fallen into that thing of making me buy it about three or four times. Thank you. I got
so
appreciate that.
So not my
that.
Idea. So not my idea.
But this is everybody. Every DVD I own three copies of.
Right.
Because I have to get it right when it comes out.
Totally.
And then it's just there in its little cardboard box with the DVD.
I have at least
barely
10,
a booklet at that point.
Yeah.
10 versions of Terminator 2 and Evil Dead.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
constantly come out with variations
of that.
We got
The Godfather, Goodfellas, shit like that, where it's just like I got 10
Anytime they're like, now we got a documentary where you can see the cast 10 years later, I'm like, give me it.
Gotta say it.
Totally.
Yeah.
I roped into Clueless, buying Clueless, because I was just like, I gotta see what they all look like 10 years later.
Yeah, and I was watching it and watched all the behind the scenes stuff and the exclusive. Some of the funniest stuff is the when you leave the dialogue on between all you guys as you're watching the movie.
Yeah,
the commentary
tracks.
Hysterical.
It's fun. I like doing
drinking.
Those.
I just I look, I don't know what was going on, but it seemed to me the longer it went on, the more Affleck started talking.
Right.
And just a little slurring was happening.
Right,
in his
right.
words during
Muse, and that commentary tracks for the first commentary track, which we recorded for the Clerks Laserdisc, mm-hmm. like which we recorded on the set of Mallrats back on Laserdisc. Muse
the
was there and he was drinking, and by the end of the commentary track, he's just unintelligible. And you just hear him like, fuck you. Yeah. Pretty funny stuff.
What do you think, as a director, best director's film you've ever seen? I know if it's Citizen Kane, let's go asterisk. Okay, anything.
Right.
Like
let's say Citizen Kane is the bar and go beyond that. I think Jaws is an insanely well directed movie.
Yeah.
JFK is an insanely well directed movie. Last Temptation of Christ is an insanely well directed movie.
Spielberg's got a technique that is so recognizable that I mean I've watched old. Like Universal Studios, Columbo.
Right.
And I'm watching it and going, that's fucking Spielberg.
And he did.
And at the end, you see Spielberg directed, you know, that episode of Columbo.
Right.
And you could tell by, you know, what he's doing with the camera that it's Spielberg. That to me is amazing.
That guy is a genius. Some people will bitch about him and be like, oh, he's fucking this. He's too Spielbergian, blah, blah, blah.
Spielbergian.
But whether you love or hate any given movie of his, you have to cop to the fact that dude is really a genius at what he does.
Amazing.
Yeah.
How about Clockwork Orange?
I love that movie. I mean, Kubrick was a fantastic director too.
That's another one who you look
at. The Shining yesterday was on TV, and that's a movie that even when it's cut up on TV, I'll still fucking watch it.
Yeah. He's another one.
Totally.
Though,
you
visually,
see his movies and you're like, those stark wide shots, tracking wide shots.
What about slow push in like that with the stark walls?
What about Caddyshack too?
Caddyshack 2, Back to the Shack. Fantastic.
Great.
I see the Pink Panther made a lot of money over the weekend.
How much did it make total? It should have made nothing.
I think it's up to
60? $61 million.
Yeah. All right, is that bad? How much do they spend on it?
They spend about 70, I think.
It's a success.
Because you got the DVDs
and everything else.
That's the thing. Like basically, if they can ring the bell of what they made shooting the flick, if they can win at the box office, DVD will take care of
it. We get very pissed off about movies like Pink Panther, The Honeymooners. We're like, why are you making a Honeymooners
movie? I don't think they're going to make another Pink Panther, though, after this, because it didn't make enough money for them to warrant going back.
And this was on the shelf for a while, right?
Yeah, they shelved it because it was so bad. Now they put it out when there's nothing else happening. But Steve Martin, of all people, it's like he's one of the funniest guys ever. He's such a good actor, and he does this dog shit spit in the face of Peter Sellers. It was like, why do you do it?
Yeah,
it's not
why
a CGI
would you step
movie?
Into those shoes? It's like a
it's
role
arrogant.
That was so insanely
just
defined
leave them
by somebody
unfilled
else.
Now, you
yeah,
know?
It's just like, what's the point? And the studio perspective is like, well, if we don't remake these movies, we can't get an audience to go see these movies, so let's remake them for another generation. I mean, it's a vulgar grab at a dollar, essentially.
Yep.
And the one to me, which was the most insulting and the one I was most outraged
by. Can I guess? In-Laws?
No, Bad News Bears.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Bad News Bears is a brilliant
movie. We just talked about that a couple weeks ago.
I mean, I love Richard Linklater, the guy that directed it, but there was no reason to remake it. I understand why I did it. They were like, we'll give you $6 million to head it up. Like, why not? But
I finally watched that on demand, and I was so pissed off and went out the next day and got the original to just, you know, get the original back in my head.
I was talking to Courtney.
And I thought it would be good because of Billy Bob Thornton. I'm like, oh, my God, he was made to play this role.
Right.
And I get mad when they remake comedies especially, but... Then he's got the kids drinking non-alcoholic beers. He's drinking non-alcoholic beers. They're not cursing. Meanwhile,
Walter Matthau was drinking as he's driving with the kid in the car.
No seatbelts.
I was talking to Quentin about it before I saw that movie, and because I'd asked him, I was like, "What'd you like last year?" And he said, I like the Bad News Bears a lot. I was like, get out of here. Really? He goes, yeah, it's like a really good cover tune. Like, you know, it's like basically it calls to mind everything about the original that you like. And I thought that was an interesting perspective. And then I watched the movie. I'm like, I'd rather see the original. I'd rather not have the original call to mind. I'd rather just flat out watch the original.
Greg Kinnear was just not believable as the
remember
nasty
Vic Morrow
coach?
Just fucking slapped his fucking kid down on the mound. Like, Greg Kinnear doesn't slap his kid. He slaps his hat off of him. And then he kind of gives him a push
and the kid falls back.
Something
tells me that was Vic Morrow not acting.
Totally.
he always came off as a guy that would have just smacked his kid like that.
And no one is scared of Greg Kinnear. After As Good As It Gets, no one is as frightened to him after it. You remember the character he played that?
Right.
Fucking flamboyant sissy. It's like you're not slapping anybody.
And he also, he just seems like he's playing the aggro... funny dad in the movie. Like, Vic Morrow seemed like a real guy.
Yeah.
Greg Kinnear's playing a character. And Vic Morrow's performance, you never got the impression like this guy is acting like somebody else. You just like, this dude exists.
Yeah.
He's one of those asshole parents that I knew
he
in Little
League. Smacked the kid from Courtship of Eddie's father.
Brendan Cruz.
Movie. It's such an unsung fucking gem, man. Mm-hmm. Like that first the original Bad News Bears. Like, it's insane the performances he got out of those kids.
Right.
You're sitting there going, like, there's no performances here whatsoever. Like, this, they just rolled a documentary camera on this little league team.
Because the acting with the kids in the new movie is so bad.
Oh,
it takes you right out of the movie.
It's just like, it's like watching, you know, fucking Fresh Prince of Bel-Air or something like that.
Knocks his hat off.
And the girl who played, like, remember Tatum O'Neal, mm-hmm. how brilliant she was mm-hmm. in the movie? The chick that plays Amanda in this movie is just not
her
good.
Acting, I'm like, oh, it could be the worst acting I've ever
seen.
And
you sit there going, well, I guess maybe she's really good at baseball or something.
Right.
When he did School of Rock, he hired a bunch of kids who weren't actors. He hired kids that could actually play instruments. And so I'd heard that, like, for Bad News Bears, he was doing the same thing. He's like, well, he's not necessarily going for kids who are actors. He's going for kids who are baseball players. And then in some of the outtake footage on that new Bad News Bears disc, they show that girl throwing a ball, and she's not great.
She
hits a piece of equipment or something like that, and so you're like, well, then why did he hire that girl? But I thought that making that movie was just sacrilegious because the original is so good, and they're like, yeah, but kids won't watch the original. Mm-hmm. And you're like, well, fuck kids then. Then they don't deserve it.
Yeah, then come up with something else.
Totally.
Come up with something new.
Make another Mighty Ducks. Same premise. Right. Ragtag kids, you know, give them that, but don't fucking touch
Mighty
something.
Mighty Ducks without skates.
Why is it like the last 10 years? I mean, there's been some great movies made, but why is this obsession with remakes, man? It's like is this shitty scripts floating around.
I think it's just people going like, well, we know this is going to make money. We know there was a built-in audience for it once. Maybe there's another built-in audience for it. It's kind of pre-sold. They like pre-sold. Everyone likes the safe bet. I mean, it's a business, right? Like, they just want to see returns on their fucking dollar.
There's probably more of a DVD market for the remake than there is the original, also.
And also, you get basically a bump too. If like you release Bad News Bears, you release the old Bad News Bears on DVD.
They always do that again, and
get another bump.
Like when they try to fool you on cable.
Yeah.
When a new movie comes out, a remake, and they play the old one, you're looking, going, wait, that's still in the.
Right.
What about
tricked again?
I want to see if they're going to remake the taking of Pelham 1-2-3 with Martin Lawrence.
I think they did remake it.
Yeah, the Money Train with that stupid Woody Harrelson.
No, I think they actually remade it with Vincent D'Onofrio.
I was kidding. Other than
I swear to you,
like a TV version,
as a TV movie. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the Money Train was a
rip-off. We can IMDb it and find out right now.
Yeah, I know. Greatest site ever.
Fantastic.
What did
we do before the internet? Like, did people actually rush and grab an encyclopedia and
leaf through it? I'll tell you what they did.
What did they
do? My mother insists on still doing it. We've tried to get her to use a computer. She will not. Electronics scare the shit out of her. And we tell her it's so convenient. You want pictures from us on vacation? We can email them to you. I don't want to. Ooh, no. So we tell her about Internet Movie Database because she's huge with movies, loves movies.
Right.
For that site alone, get a computer.
Totally.
She won't. She goes, nope, every year, and this is what everybody does that doesn't have a computer, I guess, I buy my Leonard Maltin book.
Oh, she gets
it's
that book?
It's this thick encyclopedia that she has to thumb through to try to cross-reference. If you want to cross-reference something on IMDb, it's easy.
Totally.
You know, she's there, like, studying. She's got a card catalog in her house with Leonard Maltin books.
Built on the Dewey Decimal System.
Yeah. All right. That's in the 800s. She will not get a computer.
The way to get her over her computer phobia is tell her you got fans fucking online.
There you go.
Well, you want to see
She'll
some pictures,
dig it. Mom, I'll get you a camera.
Let's go to Dave in Tennessee. Dave, what's up?
Hey, good morning, guys.
Good morning, Dave.
I just wanted to thank Kevin. I met my wife because of his movies. A bunch of us were sitting around, and she and I were the only ones that had heard of Clerks, and got together, rented all the movies, hung out for the weekend, and that was it.
And led to sex and love. Right on.
So thank you very much.
Oh, no props.
Film Festival.
That's
have those
hot.
At the house every so often, yeah.
That's pretty hot when people meet because they're like, we've. Have you ever seen this shitty movie? Yeah, I have. Let's talk. That's awesome.
Let's go to Robin
Clerks
Jersey.
Clerks was one of those movies that I don't think I know anyone that saw it in the theater.
Yeah, totally.
It was one of those, dude, you got to see this.
It only ever played on 50 screens around the country.
Really?
Like, never played on more than 50 screens. And it was a real, like, played in the Angelica. In Los Angeles, it played at the Lemley. Like, it was just total art house release.
Then it got passed around like a Jerky Boys tape where it was like, you got to see this.
Totally.
I'm like, what? I never heard of it. And popped in, and it just grabbed me from the start.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
It had that discovery feeling to it, like where you felt like you found it before anyone else, and you would pan it off to your friends and be like, you got to see this.
You got to see this. Yeah.
All right. Let's say hi to Rob in Jersey. Rob, what's up?
Hey, what's up, boys?
Hey.
wait for me to pile on the pressure, because I've listened to you guys for about a year now, never called in. Leave it to me to call in today when one of the best filmmakers of the 90s is sitting in with you guys. So I'm nervous as hell right now.
You're doing fine.
You're doing all right, except you're insulting me with the of the 90s
part.
Yeah,
exactly.
Really.
You're like, he's not relevant anymore, but back in the 90s, he was something.
From 93 to 94,
and
he
sir,
ruled.
Quentin Tarantino is not here.
Exactly, sir.
Well,
Rob, don't think of the million people listening to you right now. Don't worry about them. It's just us and you.
Well, I'm watching you guys on Pal Talk, and I'm also representing newsaskew.com.
Oh, right on, sir.
A little plug. And I was wondering if there's any way at all that I can grovel at Kevin's feet for his super-secret thing that was happening this evening.
Oh, for the screening? We're all booked up. We're showing Clerks tonight. Tonight we're showing it to Harvey Weinstein with an audience for the first time.
Wow.
Pulled a bunch of people. I didn't want to do this the test screening thing, the traditional test screening, because to do those, you hire a company like this company, NRG. They go out there and recruit the screening where they hang out at movie theaters and recruit people coming out going, would you like to see a free screening of a movie, a test screening of a movie? And then you know, get a wide cross-section. They get a certain percentage of males, females, and different races and... Not creeds and colors, just races.
Yeah.
I was going to be like, racist creed, but they're not like, are you a Catholic? Would you like to see this movie?
What is a creed?
Yeah, what is your creed, sir? So they collect those people, and then you have a test screening. I didn't want to do that because basically they're collecting a bunch of strangers, and then one of those cats is bound to write it up and throw it up on Anti Cool News or Dark Horizons or something. And it's just too early to spoil the flick. It's too early to let let the cat out of the bag. Movie don't come out till August.
I guess we're not invited, Anthony.
And we're booked up.
We're not invited. We'd be babbling like idiots tomorrow.
Right, you guys
we're the guys you're talking about.
Totally.
Even if you said, look, you could come tonight, but please do me
a
favor.
Talk about it.
We can't help ourselves.
Totally. By August, everyone would know every little nuance.
JJ said to me the other day, he's like, don't tell anyone you saw this movie yet. And I was like, I won't. And then I was just in here going, like, I saw Mission Impossible 3. Can't help it. You can't help yourself.
Because tomorrow you're not here. Like, oh, my God, we saw Clerks 2. This is how it is.
All right, we're not going to tell you a lot, but I got to tell you this one part.
Right. And God forbid it sucks, too, because you're like, oh, we saw Clerks 2. But we recruited the audience for this thing from our website, from the message board.
Mm-hmm.
And I basically just went through and picked out posters that have been posting there for a long time that I could trust, who I knew wouldn't, and you know, they wouldn't go out there and spoil it and write about it on the web or send in fucking secret reports to other websites or something. And some people have been like, well, that's just a loaded audience. You're just putting fans in the audience. And I'm like, well, who the fuck do you think Clerks 2 is for?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you would obviously people that like our stuff, you know, it's not like we're going for like a completely fresh audience who's not familiar with our stuff. In order to go into any movie that has a 2 in the fucking title, you want them to be aware of the
familiar
stuff.
With it.
Exactly.
You know, one of the fans is going to babble, though.
I don't know. We had one of these screenings in Los Angeles in Burbank before Christmas.
Everyone turned out to be cool about it?
Everyone turned out to be cool. Nobody spoiled it. So hopefully the New York cats, ape the L.A. cats a little bit and keep it quiet.
By Wednesday, it's going to be burnt. They'll be selling them on the street.
Exactly.
Bootleg cover.
That's always the
danger.
Well,
I got to take a leak. It's been an hour and a half.
Wow.
So you guys take break with Saturday?
Yeah, occasionally we could throw on some shit.
We're supposed to take a break every half hour, but it never works out that way.
And what is that? What do they do during the break? They don't run commercials, do they?
A few.
Yeah, a couple of
really?
Them. Yeah, not
yeah,
not
we
a
got
lot,
we
though.
Got a new hard-on cream commercial that
really?
We're psyched about. Yes, yeah. So we got
the,
that.
The
running.
Idea behind satellite radio was like you will never hear a commercial again.
That's usually on the music channels,
right.
So it's just straight music. But
they're
talk
all commercial
guys, like, guys, we got to take a piss.
right.
The fuck are we supposed to do when we got to piss?
My omelet's been here since 5 after 7.
Oh, it'll be tasty, Jim.
I haven't eaten it.
I just picture satellite radio talk radio as like a series of fucking empty milk jugs filled with urine. You know, dudes who can't get up from the mic.
Just taking leak and wide mouth Snapple bottles.
Exactly.
We should do that one day. Lock the studio door.
Just going completely Howard Hughes and walking around in tissue boxes and pissing in bottles.
Are you hanging? You going?
I'm here to. I got nothing else to do all morning. So if you guys want me out, that's totally cool. I'm not
hell no.
I'm sure
no.
If you've got a bunch of shit to get to, I certainly don't want it to become the fucking.
I'd love to hear your take
show.
On a lot of this.
We
stuff,
can do all the stuff you normally do. We
yeah.
Do the papers
yeah. Let's do
and
that,
shit.
Man. That'll be fun.
Yeah,
we're
totally.
Hanging out with Kevin Smith today. Stay there. You're checking out the Opie and Anthony program on XM Satellite Radio, the ONA virus spreading across America. And we're loving that. Getting more gooder and a little bigger every day, right, Anthony?
That's what they tell me.
Opie.
That's what they call me.
I don't know, more gooder is not.
More gooder is perfectly
actually
acceptable.
It's more gooderer.
More gooderer.
Which is even bester.
Hey, how cool is this? Kevin Smith, he's having such a good time. He's just going to hang out with us all morning.
You know what he's doing right now, though?
He's smoking.
He's smoking. But he's I'm just wondering if he's leaning against the building, just smoking a cigarette, because that would be the oddest thing, walking down 57, turning your head, and seeing Silent Bob sitting there just standing against the wall just smoking a butt. Is that what he's doing?
Yeah, Danny.
That's exactly what he's doing.
Is anyone looking at him and going, well, fuck, dude, that's Silent Bob.
Well, yeah, because... how come I can't hear anything? Yeah.
Oh, you're fine.
You're on.
Don't worry about you.
Where's the headphones? Yeah, he's because you know, he's got that overcoat on,
yeah.
And he's just exactly how you'd expect. You know, it looked like it was the outside of the convenience store.
It's the setup. Yeah.
He's got the cigarette.
We should tape
with the overcoat, and there he is, just
God
smoking a cigarette.
Damn. We should have brought the camera down there and taped that.
Well, I'm sure he'll go back down for another one next
get him
break.
On the next
so
cigarette
by
break.
The smell of it, it seems like you might
have
went down and had
I may
a cigarette
have
with Kevin.
I may have.
Danny,
all the boys are smokers.
I have good sense of smell, but I'm stuffed. I can't tell.
Yeah, I'm terrible. I'm awful.
Trust me. After Atlantic City, I could smell smoke. Holy shit.
Why? Dude, they smoke down there.
How awful are the casinos down there with the smoke?
I fucking hate Atlantic City. I want to go on the record and say that.
Okay. Atlantic City does
I had to go down there,
really blow.
Saturday night, and I had a good time because the reason I went down there was great, but the place itself, ugh.
Only place to go, Borgata.
Well, of course.
Borgata's the only place
you
in
played
Atlantic
at the Borgata, right, Jimmy?
It's the only place I work, AC.
And Borgata.
Nice.
And we went down there. We had a great time. The Borgata, you feel like you're in one of the new hotels in Vegas.
Five-star hotel.
It's unbelievable.
All the cocktail waitresses are all hot. They wear the skimpy little things. It's clean. The hotel rooms are nice. Everything's brand
new.
The
food is good.
Yeah.
And when I went down to Atlantic City, I don't go down there often. I was wondering why the Borgata was so far away from everything else. Now I know.
Yeah.
They don't want to be part of that.
Nope.
Eventually, that Atlantic
City, the marina area,
Atlantic City near the boardwalk, that's going to be like old Vegas.
Yep.
Because I was at the Caesars Hotel, and I checked into my room, and they didn't give a shit. So, well, I don't give a shit, and this is what I have to say: your hotel stinks.
Yep.
I got a room. I looked out the window, no view whatsoever. Whatever. I'm just there to crash. There's a generator as big as this whole fucking studio right outside the window, just going like this. So I called down. I'm like, you're kidding. You actually give people this room? You know, save this for the maids or something. You shouldn't be, you know, giving this to people. That
I'm
are
a high roller.
Spending their hard-earned money. It's $400 a night, and this is what you get?
Yeah.
And I, you know, I'm not that I'm not fancy like Anthony. I just need a place to sleep. I don't.
I need
shit.
I need to be comped when
I go
there.
Anthony needs a suite, and Ope wants three hots and a cot. So Ope is not high maintenance.
I really don't care, but for $400, I care. I'm like, what? I'm not sleeping in a room with a generator right outside the window and garbage right outside the window as you're looking at a brick wall.
Were the blueberries evenly distributed in the muffin?
The blueberries.
And, dude, I tell you, I had a similar experience in a hotel, which I got to. Just remind me after, even
all
worse
right
than the generator.
And then I get it. You know, the colors of the room, they're so awful because they don't want you in the room. I get it. I've seen the specials on fucking casinos, but could you, like, pretty it up a little bit?
Gussy it up?
You feel nauseous staying in the room because the colors are all fucked up, and they do this on purpose because they don't want you to get comfortable
not
in the hotel room. They want you downstairs gambling.
Not in the Borgata, though.
That's what I mean, but this is the point I'm making. When you go to Vegas, even, they give you the really nice, fancy rooms. They don't mind that when you are done gambling that you have a nice, relaxing location to go to. This room, I swear to God, I was getting nauseous. Like, what's wrong with me? Do I have food poisoning? And I realized it was the color schemes on this, on the wallpaper and shit. And they're like, well, and they couldn't believe I was complaining. I'm like, for $400, I don't want to, you know, sleep in a room where I have to hear a generator all night.
Yeah.
You know?
I had the same experience at the Tropicana over there.
Of course
another
you did.
Another ancient hotel with ancient people working there. They didn't have any internet in the hotel rooms. They had a hot tub in there that had this, you know, remember when digital watches first came out? They were red numbers. Red, like, LCD LEDs. That's what the control panel on this hot tub had. And it was punched in. So it was just this 70s hot tub, like the first one. Never getting there.
Yeah.
Ugh. Yeah. It's an awful old room.
I had an alarm clock in my room that was like anchored down or whatever, so you couldn't pull it out of the wall. It's like, I don't want your stupid alarm clock. What am I going to do with your stupid alarm clock from 1984?
Yeah.
Dude, I hated Caesars. Hated it.
All those old
And they didn't give a shit that, you know, I had a bad room. Finally, after I called three times, because I'm like, look, this is just unacceptable. They're like, well, we're having a car show, and there's, you know, the hotel is sold out. I'm like, I can't sleep next to a fucking generator all night. So finally, they moved me up a couple floors, but... And then after midnight, the casino itself just completely, and I mean completely infested by hookers.
Infested?
No, completely. Like to the point you're scared. I'm not gonna lie to you.
Where was this?
I had to go down to Atlantic City. That's why I'm a little tired today, Kevin. Which, I had to drive back and forth, and I had a bad experience.
And you stayed at shitty Caesars.
We stayed at Caesars. It was a family thing. I went down there. I had a good time, but. Yeah. But I've been to the Borgata.
You gotta go. Great. To the
I've been to the Borgata.
That's the only place amazing. To go.
Borgata
now.
Is like the when they opened that place. I went there. I was like, wow, somebody finally approximated Vegas here.
Right.
Like, it feels
right.
like a Palms Hotel kind yep. of thing. Like a Maloof.
But
Brothers
I was on the
affair.
Boardwalk with, at Caesars, and I had a really shitty room with a huge generator outside the window, and they didn't give a shit. And I'm like, I can't sleep with a noise going all night long. And I questioned them, like, why would you, like, give this room to anybody? And they couldn't believe I was actually complaining. I'm like, I never complain. I never.
They don't pump any of their money back into the hotels over there on the boardwalk. Uh-huh. It's just a done deal. They know whoever comes in, it's day trip people. They're not getting the high rollers that are flying in to be there. They're day trip bus people that come in, so they don't give a shit.
And the whole place is one look away from a huge riot. yeah. Breaking out. It really is. You're walking around, everyone's hammered, but most people are very questionable to begin with.
I don't want
one dirty look at your girl or something, and it's on.
I don't want to trash it because it's the home state, but like I thought I knew what a casino community was until I hit Vegas. Then I was like, oh my god.
No, but see, this
it's
is
nice
the,
yeah. here. Yeah. You know, it's warm. It's yeah. nice. The people are fucking nice. There's still like if you're into the you know if you're into any kind of vice, there's a seedy element to it.
Yep.
But the seedy element out there is just there's still kind of safe. There's a safety to it. The Atlantic City, the community around Atlantic City is kind of
yeah. There's
a little frightening
in Vegas. There's a peripheral economy
right.
that is thriving. You
Ooh.
Know there it's you got Vegas
right.
and they got people that live and work in Vegas
right.
In Atlantic City, you have the casinos. And people that don't work in the casinos don't work anywhere, it doesn't look like.
Right. They work you over.
They work you over, yeah.
They're just
you make a wrong turn around there somewhere, yeah. and you're like, oh, Jesus.
You have two choices, casinos, projects.
Yeah. That's it. That's pretty much what it is.
But what I brought up is the Borgata, you know, they built their place far away from all that. And I was right. wondering at the time, like, why would they do that? They just don't want to be a part of that, and they want to start something new. They want to start, like, a new Vegas.
When you're driving in, it's far from the Strip.
Yeah,
it's far from everyone
yeah.
else.
Marina, whatever.
Yeah.
And I was telling these guys, and right around midnight, I mean, the casinos get infested with hookers.
Really?
It's not even a question.
I'm so not good at spotting hookers, man. I'm not a good hooker spotter. The only time I've ever spotted hookers was if you live in Los Angeles and you fly to Vegas, you usually fly on Southwest out of the Burbank Airport, what they now call the Bob Hope Airport.
Yeah.
And it's very small but like insanely convenient, better than going to LAX. And you'll be on this flight to Vegas and it'll be littered with gorgeous women.
Oh,
and you're sitting there going, wow, like what were they? Is there a convention? And
hey.
Then you realize that it's the hookers, like the high price call girls that work Los Angeles who go to Vegas for the weekend. Like when you
wow.
order them on the internet, they
yeah.
fly out there and it's you're looking at them going, why is so suspicious? There's so many good looking women on this flight.
Here's a good way to tell if a girl's a hooker, and this is a very if she's under 300 pounds and she's talking to me, she's probably being paid.
Or, Jimmy uses a lot of yeah. hookers.
The pros?
I've loved yeah. spent a
there's,
lot.
There's a logic to it, I think. If I wasn't married, hookers would make a lot of sense to me.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I've never, ever gotten a hooker, even like as a kid when, you know, especially growing up on Long Island, a lot of the guys would be like, hey, why don't we go into the city tonight? And when the city was scary.
Right,
New
right.
York City was like really scary and stuff. And just like was not even... I would not even think about doing it.
The
and
only,
then these guys like Jimmy, that's just...
The only involvement I've ever had with hookers was after I got married.
Really?
Yeah, with the wife.
wife was like, let's bring a girl in.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, no, I kid you not.
Look at you.
Yeah.
You pulled that one off.
A couple times. I wasn't even my idea. It was hers, which means I'm a terrible fucking lover because she's like, let's bring a pro in. But not a regular occurrence, but it's happened on more than one occasion. And it's kind of fun and kind of weird and out there, but there's something wonderfully convenient about, like, that's done, and there's no awkwardness, like, we have to see that person the next day, and like, oh, remember when we were all doing weird
really
things? Yeah.
Wow.
It's interesting. Great. Thank God she doesn't listen to radio, the wife.
That is really something to pull off and not have to pay
she's,
thousands of dollars.
She's a wonderful woman. For. Wonderful woman, that wife of mine.
Yeah. She could I gather.
She's one of these chicks, like most chicks, who's very suspicious. Like, I do a lot of college gigs and stuff, mm-hmm. go out and do Q&As, and she's just like, you know, I don't trust you going on the road. I'm like, I don't want to fuck anybody else. Like, you're fucking it, man. Like, what, who could I possibly fuck who would offer me more than you do? Not just like what we do one on one, but like whatever else comes into it later on. Like, mm-hmm. I'm trust me, I am totally trustworthy.
Girls at the colleges kind of throw themselves at you.
Like, I mean, but the thing is, I look out at my audience, a bunch of dudes look like me. You know, if there's three chicks in the audience, I'd be surprised. You know,
it's yeah. Like,
I think we have the same audience.
Yeah, we you know what
Smith.
I'm saying.
We do road shows and stuff. We'll do like we're doing St. Paddy's at the Hard Rock,
right?
And it is just full of cocks.
Totally,
just
it's a sausage party.
Dicks all over the place.
I always whisper to Anthony, maybe we should be a little nicer on the radio.
Yeah, talk about stuff girls like.
We
every
soften up the act just a bit so we can have something nice to look.
We
at.
Need to start talking about juicy clothing and right. Louis Vuitton, and maybe some broads will show up.
And the
up.
Latest movie on Lifetime.
Exactly.
The Opie and Anthony road show is where a five is treated like a queen. Any chick there who might be a five who shows her tits, the guy's like, "You're fucking gorgeous.
They
you're terrific."
Love her. At least you made Jersey Girl. Come on.
That's
that was
true.
Like that was like endearing to the lady.
So there
folk.
Are some people out there who some Lifetime audience watchers.
Right.
The older women who'd be like, oh, I like his movies, even though they've only seen that one.
This weekend, a Lifetime movie premiere, Jersey Girl.
That would play
you're
so
see
well
that.
There.
Oh, it will.
So well there.
They'll love it. Anytime the mom dies.
Sadly, didn't play well anyplace else. Lifetime. Should have made it directly for a Lifetime.
Lifetime. Starring Marky Post. Just remember, like, when Lifetime first really kicked up, it was the same five people. Valerie Bertinelli in a very special movie about a guy that she meets that's really cool, treats her great.
Right.
She's telling all her friends what a dream this guy is. And he's got a deep, dark secret.
Right.
And it won't be long before she's just got two black eyes and he's pounding her in the face.
Wearing sunglasses, her friends are suspicious.
Yeah, what
it's
happened?
It's midnight.
Oh, I fell down the stairs.
Mother, may I sleep with danger? Next on Lifetime. I just watched a Lifetime movie. Bought it on DVD called Murder in the Hamptons. And there's a chick on the show. I've never seen this show without a trace. Her name is Poppy Montgomery, I guess. She's an actress, and she was in this movie about this chick who married this rich guy and then kind of fell for the contractor who was rebuilding their house, and then they conspired to kill the dude and killed him, and she died of cancer. But it was a total, like...
died of cancer.
Total, like, you're sitting there going, what a hateful bitch, and then she's dying of cancer. You're like, I feel kind of bad. But it's like, you sit there going, the formula for the Lifetime movie is, like, women on top. All the way across the board.
Oh,
it's like
yeah.
smart enough to fucking marry rich, smart enough to kill a husband off, mm-hmm. and then poignant enough to die of cancer.
Right.
And there it is. Perfect Lifetime movie.
And then the original programming is always, you know, the woman doctor, woman lawyer, very in control.
Yeah, there's a women's doctor show, I forget what it's called, but the chick who played Joe on Facts of Life is on the show.
Is
Nancy
on the
McCann,
show.
Yeah.
Great.
Nancy McCann.
Well, she's powerful.
Is there a movie out there you haven't seen, Kevin?
Yeah, tons. I mean
is there? How about a movie that people would be surprised that you've never seen? Because it's obvious that you have a crazy DVD collection.
I have never seen Casablanca to this day, and people get outraged you tell them that kind of thing because you're supposed to do your whole movie history, but never seen Casablanca yet.
Right.
Well, if you would have stayed in college, you probably would have seen
I probably
seen
would have
that.
Seen
yeah.
it if I'd stuck around a
Instead
little longer.
Instead of wasting your money making a movie.
I'm in that great time of year. It's just kind of coming to a close right now where from October to, like, February, they send you every
single movie ever made.
As a member of the Academy, they send you all the current movies. So, like,
from October to February, I don't leave to go see a movie. I just watch everything. I'm like, I watch Brokeback at my house. I watch Capote at my house. Everything that's up for an Oscar, I saw it.
You watch History of Violence?
History of Violence. Loved it.
God,
that was great.
That was my favorite movie.
Yeah, that was in my top. I think I had it in my top 10 or just missed the top 10, but I thought that was great. Total surprise. I had no idea what it was.
Yep. I thought the name of the movie fucked it up a little bit because it's you almost think, strange. What is this, a documentary or something?
Right.
It's a great movie.
Mm-hmm. He was
William
good. She was good.
Was
I could watch. He was fantastic. I could always watch Maria Bella. I think she's a really cool actress.
Right on.
And
yeah.
She has zero compunction about taking her gear off, too.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah. Some of the sex scenes in that movie were pretty
hot
crazy.
When they fuck on the staircase. Yeah. You're just like, right on, man. Married
all
couple
bruised up.
Yeah.
You see in The Company of Men, it was a great film about some deaf girl that works in this company, and the two guys are, I think, betting as who can fuck her first.
Right.
It's something along those lines.
Aaron Eckhart, and he's the bet is whether they can make her fall in love with her and dump her. Like, just to be hurtful.
Yeah. Jesus. It was really mean-spirited. Yeah. One of the guys falls in love with her.
Neil LaBute made it. It was a couple of years ago. The guy that did, he did Nurse Betty a few years after that, and he did this, he's a playwright, but he directed this movie. Great movie. Angry film.
Yeah.
Like, really great.
No one movie I'm surprised didn't get more of a buzz was Murderball.
Yeah, Murderball had such pre-release hype. Like, from Sundance to the moment they released it, tons of coverage and tons of, like, if you go, like, here it's the Village Voice, but in every city they got a Village Voice type paper, like a kind of counterculture paper that comes out on a weekly basis. Their weeklies, it would be the cover of a weekly in every city I'd been to right before it came out. Then it came out and just a lot of people didn't
and now the DVD just came out and with not much of a buzz. I love that movie.
It's totally a good movie, but it's, you sit there going, wow, man, I guess they're angry. They're really angry to be in those wheelchairs.
Good way to channel their anger.
Yeah.
Wheelchair rugby, who knew?
Yeah.
You get a lot of people emailing you like, hey, I made this on iMovie. Take a look at it.
Yeah, but I get a lot. What I get a lot of is people hand me things. If I go to comic book shows or Q&As, they'll hand me DVDs of their movies.
You ever see anything that was like getting
you
a chuckle?
Back in the day, I used to actually watch them. We'd kick back with the friends and we'd watch them. And every once in a while, you discover a real gem. And when I say gem, I don't mean like, wow, I'd back this. It's just so bad, it's good kind of thing. Where you want to get involved in the lives of the people that made it and whatnot. Like, because they'll give you these elaborate fucking press kits in history where you can follow their whole story of what led them to making this. And there was one that we saw. It was like a movie made by this married couple, and I think they were in Canada, and it was a movie about... he was an assassin, but the dude looked like he was 12 years old.
Yeah,
and his wife's in the movie.
Their casting is always so bad.
Well,
with these,
they cast themselves. You know,
they cast themselves.
They cast themselves. They work with what they have. And the movie was just so over the top bad that we wanted to call them and get involved in their lives and see what led to this and why they think that this will lead to other things. And,
yeah.
Forget the name of the movie, but that was the last one I actually watched, and that was back in, like, 98, 99, 2000.
I've seen some, like, Star Wars fan films that they make that are just the most elaborate things that costuming and CGI work.
There's that, like, one. What is that one? And I look to you, Kev, because I assume you would know. The one that they made that's online.
Duality?
Is it Duality?
Duality is the shorter one. Then there's one called Revelation.
Revelation. I should have looked at fucking you, sir.
Just like the guy went all out with this thing, man.
Revelations, I've heard a lot about.
Some of the CGI work was amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing on it. That they're doing them on their
Then you would imagine that this would lead to another gig of some sort, but you don't hear the follow up story. Like, there was that dude who did that Batman Dead End short.
Sandy Cholera.
That looked great, didn't it?
It was this short where he did a Batman who, like, rather than the Batman they do in the movies where the dude's wearing, like, the hard armor and whatnot, he wore a Batman costume that kind of looked like the Alex Ross type Batman, like Batman in tights. But it's like this fan geekgasm picture where it's only about 15 minutes long. Mm-hmm. But first there's Batman battling the Joker. Then...
And who played the Joker in that?
Then,
Boner from Growing Pains.
Boner from Growing Pains.
Really?
And you couldn't even tell that was him.
Wow.
With the makeup on.
Then they introduce Predator into the film, like the Predator. Mm-hmm. Then they introduce fucking aliens into the film. So you're sitting there going, it just keeps getting better. Like, what's next? And it's just Batman battling fucking, like, the Joker who gets killed by a fucking Predator or an alien first.
Alien.
And then Batman battling the alien. Then the alien shows up to battle fucking Predator. And Batman's got to battle the alien and the Predator. Astounding. You're sitting there going, like, God, this is what it would be like if there were no corporations and you could just do whatever you wanted.
Great.
It looked fantastic.
Yeah.
Dude did a great fucking job.
Yeah. You hear of a film called White Chicks Incorporated?
Mm-mm.
It's arguably the worst film ever done, starring Jim Florentine,
Artie Lang?
No, Artie Fletcher, myself, and Rich Voss, and it could be the worst thing ever put on film.
Really?
Do you do a spit take awful. In it?
No, I don't do a spit take in it, but I do
have... That's the criteria for the worst film ever made?
I love Jimmy's spit takes.
He's the best at it, I gotta tell you, Kevin.
I've done a couple of spit takes that are actually very good, but in this one, I play a celebrity comedian. And it's so... I get the douche chill thinking about that I actually got up early and said, I'm going to do a movie. Like, I felt like I'm going to do a movie, and I'm awful, and everyone else is awful.
We all have that one piece of secret shame somewhere in our resume.
You have Clerks predated stuff, predating
no.
Clerks?
First thing I ever did.
The first camera you picked up, not
first
even
camera
8mm?
Well, I mean, technically, when I was in... I did 4 months at a film school in Vancouver, British Columbia, and we did this little short. It's on that Clerks disc called Mayday, and it was supposed to be a documentary about... a tranny, a pre-op transsexual, and we shot her performing, but then she wouldn't do the interview.
Yeah,
so
just
the documentary
didn't come together.
Apart,
yeah.
So then we turned it into a documentary about how our documentary fell apart. Called it Mayday instead.
Did she ever get the operation?
She did, and then when I did that, that dude called up about that Vancouver show. When I was at the Vancouver show, she showed up. She was at the show, and she had gone through with it and got the dick cut off and whatnot. And it was, I hadn't seen this woman or this guy, who is now a woman, in like 10, 11 years at that point. It was kind of strange.
I never know what to call them.
Like, yeah, well, at this point, I guess she's a total she, but then she wasn't. I mean, Vancouver, back in the day, man, Vancouver, when I was going to film school there in 92, hooker land.
Yes.
Like, tons and tons of prostitutes. I'd walk to school in the morning, and you would know these were fucking prostitutes because they would solicit you. Tons of hookers, and then I spent the last 3 months in the summer up in Vancouver again because I was working on this movie, acting in this movie called Catch and Release with Jennifer Garner, and now the hookers are gone, and it's all about fucking crystal meth. Like, it's a lot of fucking people on the streets. Yeah, it's kind of sad. It's weird. You go out to eat at a restaurant. I'd pull up to the steakhouse they had there called Gotham, and I was eating there quite a bit. And you'd get out, and you would see people doing deals right there on the street. Like, I saw some dudes, and they all look like they just got the shit beat out of them for some reason.
Yeah.
Like, they're all scarred up and whatnot.
For some reason, yeah, crystal meth kind of chews you up.
It really chews you up. And they approach each other in this kind of awkward fashion, and one dude will grab something out of his mouth and put it into the mouth of the other dude, and that was their handoff. That was the deal. It was nuts. I'd never seen anything like it before. And I'd been around.
Spit his hand,
fucking
rip his pants down.
You know, basically a total broke-down affair.
I got blown in an alley in Vancouver. I went there to a sober event in 1990. I was like 3 years sober with a bunch of sober people. We went up to like to see the gardens in Canada. And I had like $100 American left, and I spent 80 of it being blown by some girl. Me and my buddy got blown. She just bent over and fucking blew us. And I gave my last 20 to another girl who like helped her and let me pat her on the bum. And
while it was going on.
Yeah. So I got blown by two hookers
in
an alley.
She got the assist.
Yeah. She was great. And that was my Vancouver experience.
Clean alleys in Vancouver.
I remember nothing about Vancouver except a head going up and down and me handing over cash. It could have happened anywhere. I just remember.
Could have been any city, USA or Canada. Yeah,
she was just like, don't come in my mouth, eh? That's all I remember.
Let's go to Pat on the phones here. Pat, what's up?
Hey, how you doing, guys?
Hey, man. We're having a good time with Kevin Smith.
Yeah, man. Huge, huge fan. I'm one of those suckers who bought three copies of Clerks.
Right on, sir.
10 and the original.
Right on. Thank you.
I got two questions. One question's been really, really bugging me for a long time. On an evening with Kevin Smith, you were interrupted where they shut down your show.
Yes. On the end of the first disc, they shut us down in Indiana.
And what happened there?
That was it. They literally shut us down. Like, basically, they used it as a framing device on the DVD to get to disc two.
Mm-hmm.
But when that dude came out and shut us down, that was it. They were just like, they were not prepared. I tend to do these Q&As that go on for a very long time.
Yeah.
And the shortest one that I've done in the last few years, about 4 hours, and the longest was 8 hours.
Oh, my God.
So we're in Indiana, and that's the thing. I mean, I don't know if it's the same for you guys, but you go out on the fucking road, and it's like, once you're in a place, I'm married. It's not like I'm going to go out there trolling for pussy or something like that. I might as well stay on stage all fucking night because, like, I'm just thinking about the flight home at that point. So I'm like, if I can make it till, if I kill all my time there and grab a few hours of sleep, get on a fucking plane, I'm good to go. But other than if I get off the stage after 2 hours, 3 hours, I'm like, what am I going to do in fucking Indiana?
Right.
Yeah, exactly. I might as well be up here and shit. So I tend to go on for a very long time. In Indiana, I think we had hit like the 4 hour mark, and they were like, well, we got to shut this place down. We got things to do, and you can't just sit here talking all night. So
and
they closed down after that. And people got outraged. Like, the audience was kind of pissed off because it was like an audience of 3,000 people. And sometimes, like, they go, like, if you're going on, you hit the 4-hour mark, basically, at that point, half of your audience starts going, well, I've seen enough, I'm going home. Mm-hmm. You know, what more could he possibly answer? And then you get, like, the rest of them sticking behind going, who do you like better, Batman or Superman? And, like, they'll just pull fucking questions just to keep you standing there. But this audience had really stayed, and being that it was fucking Indiana, I guess there was nothing else to do, so they were all there, and they would have stayed if I'd gone on for another 2-3 hours and shit.
Yeah.
But they shut the hall down, and they got kind of outraged and whatnot. Mm. It was not a pretty affair.
Nico!
Yo, what's up, man?
What's up?
Hey, sorry my voice sucks, man. I sound like a kid toucher. But I got a question for Kevin Smith, man. I'm a big fan, and I'm black, which should really surprise you.
That's rare, Sarah. That's rare.
When you made Jersey Girl, there was a lot of stink going on around the internet about how you wanted to get away from, like, the Jay and Silent Bob characters.
Right.
What made you go back and do Clerks 2? And I got a second question for you after that.
Okay, there were a few things. I mean, at that point, I wanted to get away from Jay and Silent Bob because Jason Mewes was so deeply into heroin and Oxycontin, it was just not fun to do things anymore. Mm. Like, at the tail end of the Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back shoot, we were in Jersey for, like, the last 3 days of that shoot, and I swear to you, we wrapped on the last shot involving Jay. He went to his fucking trailer. I went to see him 10 minutes later because the Middletown cops were like, can we take a picture with you guys? I said, yeah, let me go get Jason. And Jason had just went and buried himself in a pile of fucking heroin. And he immediately, it was like night and day. His appearance, his demeanor completely fucking changed. And he spent the next fucking 3 weeks just going on a serious bender. I went back to Los Angeles to cut the movie, came back out to the East Coast in July to shoot a music video with him. Showed up at the place he was living in Keensburg at that point. And I hadn't seen him in, at this point, 2-3 months. So I'm waiting outside. His sister was outside. She's like, I'll go get him. And she goes into the house. And then this real skinny, skeletal, long-haired, Jason-looking dude came out of the house. And I was like, wow, man, Muse is hanging out with crackheads that look like Muse now.
Shit.
And then that crackhead got in my fucking car, and it was Jason. And he had dropped like 40 pounds over the course of 2 months because he was doing some crack at that point. And it was heartbreaking. I was just I just broke down and started crying. It was just like, dude, I can't do this anymore. I can't watch you throw your fucking life away. And I tried to help this dude, would bring him in, go cold turkey in my fucking house. Like, I would give up months at a time and just sit on Jason, just babysit Jason. It was this whole period where I would take him to the, methadone clinic every morning in Asbury Park and shit. And, like, our day was structured around the meth clinic. We'd get up at 6 a.m, fucking drive to the meth clinic. He'd bang his fucking meth. And then we'd go to fucking Dunkin' Donuts and he'd get a manager special where they put fucking sprinkles on it and shit like that. Then we would go out looking for 12-inch Greedo dolls at Toys R Us when they first started doing those 12-inch Star Wars dolls. And Greedo was hard to find, so we'd go to all these Toys R Us's in the fucking greater New Jersey area.
Distracted.
Just constantly keeping him distracted. And every day was spent, like, coming up with a program to keep that dude from thinking about fucking heroin. So it just got to be too much at that point. And finally, there was a rehab counselor who was like, look, you're not helping him. Like, you keep throwing a net out for this guy. Like, he needs to hit rock bottom. And I was like, well, what if his rock bottom is him
dead? Death, right.
And he's going, you can't do anything about that. If he's going to die, he's going to die. And I was like, this is my friend. And he's like, don't you understand? Like, you're not helping this dude. He's like, you need to really step off. You need to step back. You need to not throw a net out for him. You need to hit him with some hardcore tough love. Like, don't let him in your house. Don't let him see your kid because they have a real tight relationship with my daughter and whatnot. So that kind of led to the whole, like, all right, I'm not going to do any View Askew flicks anymore. And also at the same time, I was like, I'd like to try one that has nothing to do with the other movies, mm-hmm. one that really stands alone by itself. So that led to that. When Jason cleaned up, I mean, some people are like, well, obviously Jersey Girl didn't work, so he wants to do Clerks too. And they've kind of missed the target but hit the tree. It wasn't indicative of me going, oh, fucking nobody wanted to see Jersey Girl, so I better go back to the well. Like, if I was going to do a safe movie, it would have been The Green Hornet. Like, a movie mm-hmm. that, like, had a big budget, I'd get a huge fucking payday on. You know, they'd spend a bunch of money marketing it to make it work. That's a safer bet than going back and doing Clerks too, which we made for, like, you know, very little money. And it doesn't have a bunch of people that love it on video don't mean they're going to go out and see it. Like, if the movie wound up making 25 to 30 million theatrically, I'd be fucking shocked. And right. that would be great because we didn't spend that much to make it. But mm-hmm. that's not, like, a safe bet movie. And the Jersey Girl part of it, the equation, wasn't because it didn't work, so shit, I'm going to go back to something that I know works. It was more like the experience of making a movie where you don't have as much power as the fucking stars of the film was really disenchanting. Mm. And it's not like Affleck was an asshole or Jennifer Lopez was an asshole about it, but their relationship seriously affected our ability to open and market that movie. And there are some people on the internet who are like, oh, fuck you, the movie just sucked. And it's like, look, maybe the movie sucks in your opinion, but you can't be blind to the fact that it was an insane challenge, an uphill battle to release that movie in a post-Gili climate.
That was the worst timing, yeah.
Oh, bad.
The
really
Gili
bad.
And the fact that they
What does Gili mean? What does that mean?
That was the movie they made.
It was a movie they made. Okay. That movie
together,
Gili that came out. Yeah.
It wound up coming off like...
it was like, God. Hey, remember that movie you hated so much came out a few months ago? With those two people you can't stand, here's a second helping.
Here they are. And it was nothing but, I mean, the news, I'm sure you remember, that's all it was.
Sir, I just watched that
Ben
shit unfold,
and
I was just like, oh, my God,
this isn't good.
It's all over. And amazingly, we were able to make it. Like, that movie cost them $70 million to make, Gili, and they made $6 million. It would stand to reason that Jersey Girl following Gili would make less than $6 million. Yeah. Somehow we were able to get to $25 million, but when you spent $35 to make it, that's a disappointment. There's still a $10 million fucking loss there, which DVD takes care of, but still, it hurt. And so for me, I was like, I don't want to work with fucking famous people right now in my life. And not so much, and again, not because they were dicks or something, but it's just like, their relationship, I have no control over. I have no control over how people reacted to their relationship, but mm-hmm. it adversely affects my movie. And it's just like, I want to make a movie with people who in the whole world don't see every day on fucking In Touch Weekly's cover and know so much about their relationship where they can't divorce themselves from their public persona and get lost in a movie and shit like that. I was like, look, as long as Brian O'Halloran and Jeff Anderson don't fall in love and get married, I'm fine on the next movie.
Do you think Ben Affleck, because, you know, I mean, I loved him in a lot of the earlier mm-hmm. stuff, and now I'm kind of sick of watching him, with the exception, of course, of Reindeer Games. I mean, who couldn't enjoy a film titled Reindeer Games? wow. Do you kind of notice that he's done, like, a lot of not-as-good films lately?
There is a period Daredevil. Where he was just saying yes to a lot of things that he probably should have thought a little bit more about. The Paycheck comes to mind, mm-hmm. like the very appropriately titled Paycheck, you know, just kind of like, but to be fair, it's like as a script, I think it kind of worked, but once they put John, and then you see, like, you got a script that you like, I remember we were shooting Jersey Girl, and Matt came in for a few days to do it, and Matt, I was at this dinner with Ben and Matt where Matt was like, I just read this flick called Paycheck. He's like, I loved it. I can't do it because it's too close to the Bourne identity. He's going, but I think you should read it. And then Ben read it, and Ben wound up doing the movie. And you like the script, and you're sitting there going, wow, that's a pretty good idea. And then you hear that John Woo's attached, and you're like, John Woo's made some pretty fucking badass movies.
Yeah.
And then somehow it doesn't all gel together, and the movie just turns out kind of poorly and whatnot. And I think that happened to him a few times in a row. Like the movie he did, Surviving Christmas. You know, he's got James Gandolfini in the flick. You're sitting there going, I'm going to work with Tony Soprano. I get to do a comedy, like a comedy I've never done before, like real over-the-top, broad kind of Jim Carrey-type performance and shit.
Yeah, it's got to be hard just reading a script, looking at who's in it, and then going, oh, I know this is going to tank.
Right, yeah. Like, nobody does that.
It's got all the good ingredients.
Nobody sits there going, like, I'm just doing this for the money. Like, everyone thinks that,
that's,
you know,
going to be the next huge
best.
Movie,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, totally.
John Woo, has he done a good movie in English, though? I like all of his Chinese stuff. I don't like any of the stuff that he's done here.
I mean,
it's
I thought Face Off was watchable in a real kind of campy way, but I don't know. Like, I hated his Mission Impossible 2. I thought it was so fucking terrible, because I like that first one a lot, and Mission Impossible 2 was just like, what's going on? A lot of doves in this picture. You know, he's got a lot of birds in all his movies.
All his movies.
Just so strange. It's weird. It's just like, you go on good runs and bad runs. Like, Matt's been on a really good run lately. He's picked projects that have really kind of fucking panned out for him. And Ben was on this run where he just hit like two or three bad ones in a row.
How rough is that for those two, though? Because they'll always be compared to each other with their work because of the way they got into things.
I mean, thankfully they're good friends, so they're able to keep that shit in perspective. Mm-hmm. And I guess the key is to just not read a lot of that shit. Like, Affleck just didn't read a lot of that shit that was going on at that time. Like, because they were slamming him every day.
But that isn't even reading. That's walking down the fucking street,
totally.
Man, and turning and looking at a magazine rack or something.
Totally. I think you become inured at that point. When you're used to seeing your face on magazine covers all the time, like during that period of his relationship with Jennifer Lopez, They were on the cover of fucking Us Weekly, it felt like, every week. And I think at a certain point, you're just like...
Just get numb to it.
Hmm. I think people just got sick of him. Like, you know, like everybody else, you get a little overexposed, and people are like, ah, all right. And he is actually a good actor, but I mean,
he's
I like him.
Good actor, and he's a funny dude, too. Yeah. Like, he's a really fucking sharp, funny dude and whatnot. And he got a bad rap over that the last, like, 2 years. And he's been laying low for at least the last year and whatnot. And next flick he's got coming out is this... this movie, they were calling it Truth, Justice, and the American Way. Now it's called Hollywoodland. It's about George Reeves, the guy that played Superman, who was either killed or killed himself. They never really
figured
that.
Yeah, some kind of
and
it's
supposedly pretty good flick, and he's really good in it.
Wait, what's the film before Jersey Girl? I have to know. I have to see this now with Jennifer and Ben.
Oh, Geely?
It's called Geely.
How do you spell that?
G-I-G-L-I.
Yeah. Wow.
I find it shocking and surprising.
By the way, Nico,
you didn't know that movie just because it was
he
such
knows
a,
nothing
it's
about
such
pop
a
culture.
Part of the national consciousness.
Yeah,
like
Geely was like, Jimmy's the
way that Ishtar was bitch slapped and the way that
Heaven's Gate,
Waterworld,
I mean,
and Heaven's Gate,
yeah,
like Geely redefined it. Yep. Geely made like Mariah Carey's going, finally we're gonna stop talking about glitter. Geely really fucking took the torch and
ran. What was it about? I mean, roughly in a nutshell.
It was about a hitman who converts a lesbian.
Wow, I mean, how did that not work?
Kevin, what was the worst film you saw?
Worst film I've ever seen? I would give it up to The Flintstones, the only movie I think I've ever walked out of. I was 20 minutes into that movie, and I was like, this is terrible.
Wow.
Not a controversial choice.
No.
But
a good choice,
one, that's
a very good choice.
It's fucking terrible.
I walked out of a movie, God, it was so long ago. I think it was called Ruby.
With Danny Aiello?
I don't even know
about
who
Jack Ruby?
No, it was some kind of murder woman thing. It came out the same time I think Carrie was out.
Oh, wow, you're just going far
late
back.
Late 70s or
I walked out
like
of Elizabethtown recently.
Did you really? My friend Scott Mosier watched it, and he was just like, dude, you have to... And I love... It's Cameron Crowe.
Yeah.
Normally, he knocks it out of the park. But Scott was just like, you got to watch this movie for the opening fucking 20 minutes. He's going, just to watch like an actor not fucking fitting that material.
No, not at all.
He thought Orlando Bloom was incredibly miscast.
But I hate the people that just take you right out of movies. Mm. But I walked out of that. I was snoring so loud. I never fall asleep in the movie theater. I'm snoring so loud.
In the movie theater.
I got the old elbow and like, all right, let's get the hell out of here. It was a packed theater. It just opened up. It was a Friday night. That it was the only movie that looked like it might be something.
Right.
It was his worst writing ever, I think.
Yeah, Cameron Crowe. I mean, how could you go wrong with Cameron Crowe? But
I walked out of Mission Impossible 2 before it started.
Did you?
Yeah, it was a Puerto Rican family in front that was making noise, and my girlfriend told him to shut the fuck up,
and
I had to leave.
Yeah, you're like, we're out of here.
Hey, by the way, Nico has his follow-up question still. Nico.
Yeah.
Didn't you have a second question?
I still didn't even finish the other one. Long and short of it is that basically Muse got clean.
How did he end up getting clean? What was the thing that said, all right, look?
He, you know, for years we'd put him into rehabs. Like, we put him into this rehab called Promises out in Malibu. And that was during the Jay and Silent Bob press tour. Because we brought him out to, after I discovered him when I went to his house and he was fucking bone thin and shit, I took him with me back to Los Angeles because we were doing the press junket for Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back.
This is a weird question, but how'd you get him back to L.A.?
Just put him on a plane, brought him with me.
Everyone just staring at him like, holy shit.
I mean, but most people, it's not like he's insanely well-known where people are like, hey, that dude looks different than I'm used to seeing. Some people, you know, people involved with the flick were like, what the fuck happened to him? Mm. But while we were staying at the W Hotel in Westwood, and, you know, I was just like, dude, you got it. We're giving up the drugs, and we're going to go rehab. And he was like, right. I'm going to stay clean now. But, you know, he's like, when you're in that mindset, you just lie. Mm-hmm. He was having heroin FedExed to the hotel. His sister was FedExing fucking heroin to the hotel. And the hotel found out and called the fucking police. So at that point, I was like, dude, you have to go into fucking rehab.
Why would the sister do that? I mean, kind of a dumb question probably, but...
Was she afraid he'd get bad... I mean, that's codependent behavior, obviously. Right. Was she afraid he'd get bad stuff on the street?
She also had a problem with drugs, too. Right. I mean, it was a bad situation all around. And they would alternate between heroin and OxyContin and whatnot. So finally, I was able to kind of to use that moment to be like, dude, you're going into rehab. Like, I'd been able to use another moment a few years earlier when he borrowed my ATM card one night. He was like, hey, dude, I got here, cab dropped me off, and I don't have any money, and it was like 2 in the morning. We were at this hotel in Los Angeles, so I was like, dude, I'm sleeping. I don't have any cash on me, but here's my ATM card. Go take out $50.
Wow.
Pay the cab guy. Just give me my ATM card.
Can
in the
we
morning.
Guess how much?
take a shot in the dark.
$4,000 cab ride.
It was that was 2 a.m. and 11 o'clock. When I finally figured
in the morning,
out.
So 9 hours he had it
so
for?
So 9 hours he had it for.
I would say $5,000.
Apparently, you can't take that much out.
Yeah, well, that's the only reason.
Always tell, like, every time I go to take money out of the ATM, they tell me, like, $400. That's right. It. You've exceeded your limit. He was able to take $1,000 off of my fucking ATM card. Yeah. And I was like, how can this dude do it? I can't get more than $400 out of my fucking ATM card over the course of 24 hours. So at that point, I was able to be like, dude, that's grand fucking theft. I'm going to stick you in rehab. You got to go, or else I'm going to turn you over to the cops. He went to rehab, got clean, stayed clean a little while, eventually got back to drugs. This time, after the junket thing, we put him in a rehab in Malibu called Promises. Real plush and shit. Like, me and Jen went to visit him, and Jen was like, fuck it, I'm an alcoholic. Stick me in here. You know, they were in this beautiful house overlooking the water. The waves roll in under the house itself. Really gorgeous place. He was there for about a month, and he was allowed to go out on passes and whatnot with a sober living escort. And he went out to see a movie. He came back, and they were like, people that run the place were like, we need to talk to you. There's somebody checking in here who you know. And Muse is like, trust me, nobody I know would be in this place. And like, there is somebody that you know, and you're not allowed to talk about it to anybody. You can't tell Kevin at this point. And they were like, he was like, well, what are you talking about? Who is it? And they opened the door, and it was fucking Ben. Because remember, Ben went into rehab also right before September 11th and stuff. And then everyone forgot about that. That was like the cover of all the fucking
rags
for a while. And then September 11th happened. Nobody fucking remember that. So Ben and Muse were in rehab for a little while. Ben was in for booze and Muse was in for really harder stuff. So they spent a lot of time in that rehab together. Muse got out, stayed clean for about 4 months, and then went back on it. But meanwhile, telling everybody that it was clean. So we believed he had been clean for a good year before we caught on to the fact that he wasn't. So it went like that for a long time, and then he got busted in New Jersey. There was a warrant out for his arrest, and he was trying to stay out of New Jersey, and then finally he went back to Jersey to deal with the warrant. And they said, okay, you get rehab or 1 year in jail. And he chose – it was a tough choice for him, but he chose the 6 months in rehab. And for some reason, that rehab, the most non-plush rehab, the fucking down-and-dirty – you know, state-run rehab was the one that clicked and just worked for him. And he just got to this point. And he's like, he'd been saying for years, if I'm 30 years old and still living this way, I just want to put a fucking gun in my mouth because I can't stand this. And for years, he'd also said, like, if I could get a warehouse full of OxyContin and never have to worry about where to get my drugs again, I promise you I would never get clean. He's going, the worst part about this is trying to figure out where to find the drugs. But with this rehab, he had just hit this wall where he's just like, we don't hang out anymore. You know, you don't let me see the fucking kid. I understand all that. He's gone, I'm just tired of living this way. So I'm going to try living a different way for a while. And that was 3 years ago. And he's been really fucking successful at it. Came out of rehab. He did 6 months in Jersey, moved back out to Los Angeles, been living with me ever since. Took to a steady diet of Red Bull. Like, that's yet another product that they need to advertise is, like, if you used to love junk, this is the product for you. Because that dude drinks Red Bull like it's fucking going out of style. I watched that dude bang 10 fucking Red Bulls in the span of a half an hour. I'm like, how does your heart not explode? Yeah. He's like, dude, I used to do tons of heroin. I'm like, yeah, good point. Wow. So he's been able to stay clean. So that made it easier to think about, like, hey, maybe we can do another film with Jay and Silent Bob in it. Also, I was working on that Clerks 10 DVD, and I fell in love with the characters again, and I was just like, boy, I really want to make a movie about what I feel like it's like to be in my 30s, because Clerks was a movie about what it felt like to be in my 20s. So I was like, maybe I'll use Dante and Randall to tell that story. It came after Jersey Girl, so it was like, yeah, I would like to work with Brian and Jeff, who are incredibly low maintenance compared to the cast I just worked with. So everything just kind of clicked that way.
Thanks for being so open, by the way. We get a lot of, you know, big names in here, and it's like, they don't tell the shit. They don't tell the stories. Yep. And then they got publicists outside the studio, like, getting all nervous and stuff that we might
interesting.
We might ask that question. Oh, my God. God forbid we ask the question. Hey, Nico, what's the follow-up? That was the 20-minute answer to the...
Sorry about that. long answer.
It was still interesting as hell. Who are you kidding? Go ahead, Nico.
Real quick, man. The best line from one of your movies was in Mallrats, where they get the breakup letter. And she's like, yeah, she calls you callow in here.
Right.
And you mentioned that it means fragile and weak-willed.
Right.
Yeah, I've actually been called callow. That was the thing that just made me die laughing in that fucking movie.
It's such a great word, callow.
But also, on Silent Bob Talks,
An Evening with Silent Bob, you actually told the story about the first time you fucked your wife.
Yes, very long story.
Can you tell that again?
You know what? We don't want to monopolize the show with that shit. If anyone's interested in hearing the story about the first time I fucked my wife, fine, rent, go to Netflix, whatever, buy Evening with Kevin Smith. It's a very long story.
There are great stories on those things that are, yeah, long form.
Very long.
One of my favorites was the one with the Wild West.
The Superman story with John Peters. Yeah.
Unbelievably funny.
Crazy true story, man. Crazy true story.
Yeah, you gotta check it out.
Hey, can we go take more leaks?
Ooh.
Want to take another leak?
Drinking a lot of water today for some reason.
Me and you.
And you need a cigarette problem.
I got an iron bladder. For me.
We already told everyone that you're outside smoking in between breaks, so don't be surprised if a few people walk by to take a picture.
There were people looking at me a little suspiciously out there.
I thought it was probably odd to see you in a long coat leaning against the wall smoking a cigarette. Right. Like, you know, what's next? A Groucho walking down the sidewalk with a cigar.
This is my wife. She's just like, why do you wear that coat? She's like, it instantly identifies you. I was like, this is the only coat I have that fits me. Like, this fits me well, and I was stupid enough to wear it in the movie once, so it became that fucking coat. But I ain't ready to give it up as my coat, too.
It's not your movie coat. that you wear outside. It's what you wear.
It's what I wore, and I just happened to wear it in a movie once. But, yeah, I should just get a new coat, but I like this one. You know, I paid $10 for this coat. I don't know if you guys remember that in the malls they used to have these stores called the Oak Tree. It's kind of urban clothes for white dudes, you know.
I remember Oak Tree.
Yeah, and I bought it in the middle of the summer back in, I think, 89, 90, maybe 91 the latest. In the middle of the summer, it was on a fucking sale rack for $10. And I said, this coat will fucking come in handy. $10? I'll buy it. And it's fucking lasted me like this fucking long. I missed that store, man. That was when I used to wear like mustard colored clothing, a lot of purples, you know, upscale urban clothing. Like, not, you know, now it's like it's pants down. You see your ass cracker. You're wearing backwards and shit like that. But back then it was like if you were a white guy and you wanted to dress black, you wore a lot of purple and a lot of mustard colored vests. And I had a lot of that shit.
Is Ocean Pacific still popular? When I was younger, OP was the...
OP's back, man. OP's still...
Coming back, yeah,
Iza too.
All right, we'll talk more after the break. All right,
yeah.
Hey, closing ceremonies of the Olympics.
Oh, really? It's over?
Yeah, Olympics are finally over.
Thank God.
Yeah. Most people just didn't give a shit. We'll be back.
Curling, Opie.
Well, we like the curling. We'll get his opinion on the Olympics, maybe. And you watch any of the good old celebrity?
No, I can't stand that reality TV.
I can't get enough of this.
What are you watching? What, the dancing show or the skating show?
No, I got hooked on the skating show, and it's god awful. It sucks. We're doing American Idol. I do Flavor of Love. I do Celebrity Fit Club.
Did you?
The trashier, the better.
Have you watched the skating one?
Yeah.
I just read that story about how the chick who played Buffy, what's her name, Christy Swanson?
Yeah.
Is now fucking the dude who she was, that's her partner?
It's the greatest story ever because they hook up for this dumb celebrity, you know, skating with celebrities, and the skating guy who's won all sorts of shit in real skating events.
He won a couple bronzes.
Yeah. He left his wife who's 8 months pregnant.
She had a kid. Yeah, he left her, and a month later she had the fucking kid by herself. Right. Their second child.
That's their second child.
Like, for Christy Swanson, for the OG Buffy.
Right, that's
movie
right.
Movie Buffy.
Said, fuck
But this. It was so sad. Like this dude, the karma this dude's got like behind him now is fucking horrible.
Oh,
and there's no way
the
he could possibly
wife.
Win at this point. Like, who's going to vote for those people? The home wrecker and the dude who would leave his pregnant wife?
Well,
I would.
It was
awful, Jimmy would.
The show was fun to watch because Bruce Jenner was so god-awful on skates. We joked he looked like you know Frankenstein or Herman Munster or something.
Looks like he's had some work done, right? Like,
Oh, yeah.
Something's going on. On there because his nose got small. He's got a white Michael Jackson.
Yeah,
thing
he's all
on.
Pulled back.
Yeah,
skin on his face.
And the greatest show ever, and it's getting huge ratings. Is Flavor of Love.
What is that?
It's Flavor Flav in a mansion.
Oh, that's the Flavor.
Trying
show?
To find his latest chick.
Right.
And they're all vying for his attention, and they're all just ghetto chicks from the projects. It's hilarious.
And they bring him into a mansion,
and he votes girls off every week, and he's having sex with some of them, and it's so trashy. It's great.
Phenomenal.
It's amazing the celebrity that they're just able to revive these people's careers
out
of nowhere for, you know, limited time, but just take them from, you know, whatever they're doing, working at a gas station, and here, you're back on TV.
Yeah.
You're popular. You're signing autographs. All right, we're through with you. Goodbye. Yeah. Back to your
And
former
they'll do
life.
It, too. And a lot of people, like, the cynical take on it is just like, oh, can't these people let go of fame? And it's like, hey, man, if somebody's willing to pay you $10,000 to monkey it up when you can't make $10,000 anymore,
right.
You try saying no to that shit. You know?
Yeah, a lot of people.
It takes black people to make celebrity, like, reality TV interesting because they're like the last group in this country that's not obsessed with being polite or politically correct. And, you know, like, in a white show, they would never be fucking the girls and booting them. You know, you gotta be nice to the ladies.
Right.
So you gotta love
they give them a rose.
Yeah.
Or not give them a rose.
We kiss once on the hand. Right. You know, Flavor's fucking dumping all over him.
Yeah, Flavor's grabbing ass. And
let me tell you what happened on Flavor of Love last night. He boots the white chick off, the last remaining white chick.
Oh.
And it was down to three, so now it's down to two. So the white chick gets into it with the remaining black chick, who's just completely nuts. And all of a sudden, she just hocks a luge on the black girl's face.
A white chick hocks a luge at the black chick?
Oh, man. And then all hell breaks loose.
They're complete classless girls. Like, he just got these real whores.
No, but we're still in a political climate in this country where if it went the other way, if the black chick hooked a lube...
They wouldn't show that.
They wouldn't show it, but also you'd get away with it. But to do the white chick honking a luge...
And then the black chick, her nails came out, and she grabbed her by the back of the head and just shoves her into the camera. I was watching wrestling all of a sudden.
No, for a white girl to spit on a black girl, for them to show it is amazing because normally
they would never show that in a million years.
Yeah.
You know what? I completely missed the point. You're right.
They would never show. Normally they don't show. So hats off to them for actually going against the grain and being like, look, this is fucked up. Check it out.
You know what? It's worth playing. I got the audio.
Before
we go to break.
That was the last white chick. So now I guess the Midwest can watch. In a little bit of comfort.
Yeah. Like, a collective sigh of relief from Pennsylvania to Utah.
She was trashy white, though, man. She was. She admitted she was on Blind Date and fucked the guy there, and she's done like 4 or 5 other shows. And
oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Show whore?
But here's some audio. It's worth playing. I guess this is right when she got kicked off the show last night.
You're punking, come back, wait. Oh, hold on.
You just disrespected me.
First of all, I did not disrespect you, love.
Yes, you did.
Oh, no, you disrespected me by holding information from me.
If you would have asked, I would have told you. Everybody else in the house knew.
Why do I have to ask? So why everybody knows except me? You're in my house.
I am not here for reality TV.
That's not fair to me,
baby. This is the aspiring actress standing right in front of you.
That's
not fair. Were you trying to address me?
I just said you're the aspiring actress.
I haven't did any TV shows, and I have not been playing with his heart, and he knows it. That's why I'm standing up here, and you're getting ready to get the boot. Pumpkin is eliminated. Bitch tries to call me out. She's telling Flav that I'm an aspiring actress, which I am, but I've been real with Flav the whole time.
You know what? You know what? You are just as ugly on the outside as you are on the inside. Poops, I wish you the best of luck, baby.
Thank you very
much. If you want a real girl, pick Hoops, because she's the real girl, okay?
Bye, Pumpkin. Your opinion doesn't count. You're getting the door right now.
All right, so now they're going at it, right?
I like the...
They build the tension with that music.
So now they continue here.
At least I didn't gain 20 pounds being on the show, you fat ass transvestite looking bitch.
I look better than you making your outfit right now. Yes, the hell
she's
I do.
Fake bitch play.
Bye, Pumpkin. Bye, Pumpkin.
New York and Pumpkin, they started going back and forth. It was crazy.
He said, I don't look like a pumpkin. Give me a hug.
Bitch, you look like a f***ing man, and you need that facelift and get rid of the crow's feet with that
f***ing I don't even pay no attention.
I'm not.
You're bigger. Okay?
I'm not. Okay.
I love you.
I love you, too. Get her out of here.
All right, so
girls and guys' fighting tactic is so different.
Yeah.
Chicks are just, you got crow's feet, your ass is fat. Could you see me and Jimmy
they
just going
that?
Oh, Jimmy, you're so fat. Your
I know.
Ass
look at my man tits. I'd agree with you.
It's worse though because if you fucking haul off and hit a dude in the eye, that eye will heal and shit. But when you tell a chick that she's fat, that will haunt her forever.
She's got wrinkles. Yeah. She'll be in the mirror every day looking at the side of her eyes.
What do you remember more,
cream?
The people that have taken a swing at you, or the people who have said shit that just lives
mentally
in the back of your head?
Yeah.
It's
true.
A really heinous
girls
kind of
are
fucking
vicious
fighting.
Like that, man.
Do you hear the spit? Did we get to
here
spit?
It is right here. So this is just like The Bachelor. It's the same show.
Actually, I can slap the
go on. Do it! Slap me, bitch!
There's the spit.
Oh, and you hear things go fucking shock silence.
You put your hands on me? Did you see that bitch spit in my bitch, I would take you out.
Because I'm staying in the house and you're eliminated, you're going to spit in my hair?
Get out.
What? She spit in my face. I don't play that.
Now you got to go for real. That was
fucked up.
I just want to go home.
That's up. I don't like nobody spitting in my face.
I am definitely not a fake person. The girl I spit on is clearly so fake. Like, he's trying to, like, make an excuse. I can't even talk. I can't even breathe.
Go home and watch the video of this, by the way, because then they slow it down. It is one of the funniest 10 seconds you'll see on TV yet.
I love this girl.
Why are people so fixated with this?
Huh?
Like,
I'm embarrassed to tell people I love this type of shit.
Yeah, but this is at least real. This is the way people interact. It's not fucking Who Wants to Marry a Millionaire with an underwear model convincing chicks to fuck him in a mansion.
Right.
This is great. This is an ex fucking like junkie, which
is what This is what happened if you had real people vying for money.
Yes.
Yeah.
Who knows how much money Flavor Flav even still has at this point?
It's worth $300. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. No, it is in his house that they're in.
Right. Yeah, most of these bitches are so stupid they really think it's his mansion. It's right. Not a mansion that they're just renting for the show.
Right.
They have no idea because they keep referring to how afterwards it's going to be me and Flav in this mansion. It's like, Flavor Flav, he's lucky to have a house half that size.
We're really one step away from just like Escape from New York where they just fucking wall up the city, throw a pile of money in it, and watch people kill each other for the fucking money.
We really, like, some people talk about the ancient Rome and the Colosseum.
Same thing, man.
And, oh my God, that's horrible. This is just a different way of presenting it. The same thing. It's the same emotion.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same rush you get watching confrontation and violence and stuff. Same fucking thing.
Stephen King is such a genius because he saw this in The Running Man. What was that? Like under the Richard Bachman books, was like the early 80s.
What was my name in that one?
Oh, I can't.
Come on,
remember.
Kev.
Wasn't it Ben something? Or what was it?
It was.
Ben Richards. Hi, I'm Ben Richards.
Richard Dawson was the announcer.
We love the names they give Arnold in all these movies.
Yeah. Hi, Peter Matthews. How are you?
Yeah, right? You're fucking... Just don't even try.
All right,
Richards.
There's a movie like Total Recall was on TV last night. What was his name in Total Recall?
There's another one, yeah.
But the villain's name was Cohagen.
Cohagen.
Which, that sounds more like Schwarzenegger's name in the movie. But like he had a very plain like Dick Scott kind of name.
What was his name in that? No one knows? Come on, fan.
We'll look it up.
IMDb.
Or go to the instant feedback. Someone's got it immediately, I'm sure. We have one more clip here from Flavor of Love.
Hold up a minute, wait, cause she got my chin. I get disrespected in the worst way, you know what I mean? The bitch, she spit in my hair, and a little tiny bit got on my face, so I'm gonna whoop that bitch's ass, and I mean it. And that bitch breast stinks all in my hair.
Check this out, listen.
Oh my goodness.
Listen.
You smell that? Her breath smelled like straight up. It smelled like a toilet full of nasty ass.
It's so stupid. It's great.
Because you know the chick probably had, you know that dry, awful, sour mouth you get when you're arguing? That pasty, awful,
tacky,
sour ball sweat in your mouth?
Doug Quaid, by the way.
Doug Quaid.
Or Doug Houser was also his name in that.
Doug Quaid.
There you go, the flavor of love.
I'm Doug Quaid.
Getting huge ratings, that show.
Doug is not a movie name.
She was mad
she got it in her hair, and she's like, but she was very quick to say, only a little got on my face.
Right.
Like, as if that made it, you know, she didn't get me.
She can leave it a little more dignity.
Right, exactly.
And this chick knew how to lug, man. This thing was solid.
That is maybe the ultimate indignity, man.
Yeah.
Spitting on, I mean, short of fucking getting them on the ground and pissing in their mouth, spitting on them is pretty bad.
Jimmy loves that, by the way.
Is that your move, sir?
Golden shower? Oh, your fight hasn't
move?
Enjoyed one?
Not even a fight move, that's the love move?
No, that's before you hand over the cash.
That's the grand finale.
I've seen some spit scenes in movies that have looked completely disgusting.
There's one in Dune. Remember in Dune where the dude's like the fat dude who flies around in the suit?
A little spittle in your face.
Harkin.
Yeah, Harkin.
Just
and he fucking
horrid.
Best spit scene ever. Clockwork Orange, when they want to hold him down and Mr. Deltoid spits a fucking white line of spit across his lip. One man spitting in the face of another man, and it's just it's like one of those real mouthful of liquid spit.
It is so disgusting to have to sit there or stand there and watch real spit on your lip and how they do it.
In high school, we used to do this thing called gleeking, where you take a bunch of spit on your finger and flick it.
Oh, right. Yeah. You can really
and
get
that would
fly.
Really bum me out. But that was, for some reason, that was more acceptable than just flat out being like,
just yeah.
From fingertip removes half the germs or something like that, and then the flight removes the other
and
half.
You also couldn't spit into a cup and then drink it.
Right.
Yet the spit is, but it's your own spit that is in your mouth.
But once it goes back
works
in,
them
you're
up
like, ah.
And swallow it. Yeah. There you go.
You ever
but
do,
why can't you remove it from your mouth and then back
take it back in?
You ever do a wet willy where you put your fingers in your mouth and jam them in somebody's
yeah,
ear?
Yeah.
That was the greatest when someone was, my friend Bill D'Angelo would drive his dumb truck and I'd sit behind him and spit my fingers and jam one in each fat ear, and it was the greatest thing
I was
I've
in
ever
a
done.
Tent once and my friend was outside and it was a little cold. I invited him in and did just that, Jimmy.
Yeah.
Let's go to Mark. I haven't seen him in years. I wish he'd come by the house. Mark,
wet willy with two hands on your shoulders. Hey,
hey, Mark, what's up, buddy?
Hey, good morning, fellas. Hey. Oh, the only reason that they showed a white chick spitting on a black chick was that you and I are the only two idiots that watch that show.
Actually, the ratings for that show are crazy. I can't believe I'm discussing
this
with Kevin Smith.
Is it VH1?
Yeah,
they have the whole celebrity thing sewn up.
Yeah, they've done this. Their VH1 is really into the celebrity. What do you call it? Celebrity.
They call it
celebrity. Yeah, they've really kind of championed the whole notion
of
like not just real life TV, but
they ran out of decades to salute, right. So they had to come up with something else.
And it works. Like apparently they do a full night of that programming, yeah, and it's like through the roof.
I'm hooked. Yeah. I gotta admit, but
I liked I Love the 80s, and then. They did like the 70s, which they didn't have as much info for. The 80s was just videotaped and
right.
A bunch of stuff. They went to the 70s and, you know, they showed the pet
I did
rock
90s.
For a half
I was at me.
Yeah,
and Jay
yeah
were
we
in
saw
the
you
90s.
Guys did 90s.
Yeah.
Saw that. And but the early
tough
90s.
To be nostalgic
was,
about a decade that just ended a few years
yeah,
ago.
Yeah, the early 90s was cool because it was kind of like the late 80s
right.
And stuff, and even the mid 90s and stuff. But then the late 90s was like. Wasn't that last week?
Exactly.
Like, that just happened.
And you can't do I Love the 60s. What do you, you know, oh, look, she got into the school despite the protest.
Sick them.
Can we go take leaks, please?
Pretty much the only video they have.
It's either that or hand over a bucket.
Yes.
All right, more with Kevin Smith in just a bit. Come on, Jimmy, sing this one for everybody.
I like blacks because they're nice, and they sing really good, and they dance too.
Oh,
that's good, right? I changed the lyrics. People think I'm against black people. I'm not at all.
Of course not.
I like black people very
much.
This
is the Opie and Anthony program. Kevin Smith hanging out with us today. He's downstairs just smoking a cigarette against the wall. We got pictures and video that we're going to throw up on opieandanthony.com.
And his clerk's jacket.
Yeah, all the boys are smoking cigarettes with Kevin Smith as they
that's what you do with
the old wall outside.
That's like what you do with him to kind of be cool. You hang out and smoke a cigarette with him.
And by the way, I don't know the lyrics to Back in Black. That's why I did that. I just know, Back in Black! Hit the set! Run to be the move. Exactly. I just run out of...
You just got to go...
The only one that knows the words is Anthony.
All right,
listen, I got to hand it to Talkers Magazine. They are on the pulse of what's going on in radio. It's a brilliant, brilliant trade magazine.
It's obviously agenda-driven, by the way. We all know exactly why this happened. It's an agenda-driven thing. The guy is obviously not a fan.
Actually, I'm very... I got to tell you, I'm pissed off and proud at the same time, if that's possible. I know we piss off so many fucking people in the radio world.
Yep.
And every once in a while, it bites us in the face.
We've annoyed a few people.
Yep.
I guess Talkers Magazine, we've been featured in Talkers Magazine many, many times. Maybe not featured, but they have talked about us enough in Talkers Magazine.
It is an industry trade magazine, is what it is.
Right.
It's you don't get this on the newsstand.
Right, right.
Yeah, if you're a general manager of a station, program director, it gets sent to these people, gets sent to stations, things like that.
Right. Well, they compiled the list of the top 100 talk shows in America. Don't give it away, guys. Don't give it away.
What is it called? The Heavy 100.
The Heavy 100.
It's Talkers Magazine's Heavy 100 2006. 100.
100. Yes.
DJs or shows.
That's right.
That are deemed the hottest shows. On radio, talk shows on radio by Talkers Magazine.
Dude, you guys top five?
We get it, Talkers Magazine. You hate us. We get it.
fucking assholes.
We get it.
All right, well,
you don't like the Opie and Anthony.
I'd like to find out who compiled this. I really would like to find out.
Well, let's give the fine folks the top 10, because we must be in the top 10, right, guys?
Top 10.
Right, guys?
I think top 5.
Number 1 is Howard Stern, because everyone knows he's the
greatest. I thought we were going to go from 10 to...
No!
No!
No mystery!
This is what we do. We don't want the mystery.
I thought we were going to have a little mystery.
No mystery.
We know what the mystery is, okay? The mystery is, where does Opie and Anthony place? That's the mystery.
That's the mystery.
That's why I started with number 1.
All right.
Attaboy, Ope.
Number 1 is Howard Stern, because, hey, he's the greatest.
I'll say.
Of course. Number 2 is Rush Limbaugh.
Rush Limbaugh.
Number 3 is Sean Hannity.
Our friend Sean Hannity.
Number 4, Michael Savage.
Michael Savage.
And all these names so far deserve to be, you know, up there on this list. Number 5, Dr. Laura Schlossinger. Who looks like a corpse in her picture, by
She's
the way.
She's awful. Wow. She should go back to the good old days of just showing her cunt to a boyfriend.
That big hairy bush.
She's got, it looks, in my opinion, that she's had so many facelifts that her eyes are now cross-eyed.
Yes.
Look at that picture.
Yikes.
Our pal Don Imus in sixth place.
Oh, I thought that was Dr. Laura Schlesinger.
Fucking horse teeth she has. Jesus Christ.
Number 7 is Laura Ingraham.
Laura Ingraham. Okay, now we start getting like, huh?
Well,
what? Where most people are like, what? Who?
Number 8 is Mike Gallagher.
Mike Gallagher.
I've heard of him.
Number 9 is a guy that I will spit in his face when I see him. I have never forgotten. Neil Bortz was one of the guys that had to be on TV when we fucked up and had to tell the whole country how awful we were.
Who even though the fuck is Neil Bortz?
Even though never this heard fucking guy has never heard one of our shows.
Who is Neil Bortz?
Never heard of him, sir. Never heard of him, sir.
Who is Neil Bortz?
I've heard of him, sir.
Number 10 is Randy Rhoads from Air America.
Uh-huh.
Opie, who is Neil Bortz?
He's a guy.
I don't know.
That talks.
How are you number 9 when there's an R, a T, and a Z in your last name and no one has still heard of you?
He's got 3.75 million weekly listeners, Jimmy.
I don't care if he has a billion and all of Africa. No one knows who Neil Bortz is.
Then you got Randy Rhoads in 10th place. So, guys, we didn't make the top 10.
Oh, we weren't in the top 10.
I can understand that in a way.
Damn.
Okay?
Well,
it's opinion driven.
And we were out of circulation for 2 years.
But this is for 2005. We were on the air the entire year.
Wait.
2006.
Huh?
Oh, for 2005.
For 2005.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So we were on the air.
We were on the air the entire year. So we have no real excuses why we wouldn't make the top 10.
All right. Well,
let's see if we're in the top 20 at
least. Maybe top 20. I'm sure we are.
Number 11 is Bill O'Reilly.
Uh-huh.
Number 12 is Mandouche.
Mm-hmm.
The fastest growing FM morning drive talk personality in the nation.
Emerging superstar. What kind of agenda driven? The guy's been in radio forever.
Right.
They're making him sound like the new kid in town.
No. And he's really not picking up many stations. Howard Stern leaves regular radio. Mancow couldn't get any of those stations.
So, yikes.
I wouldn't call him the fastest growing. If he was that great, he would have picked up a lot of stations when Howard left.
I think we sound a little like sour grapes.
Well, number 13 is Ed Schultz.
Who the fuck is Ed Schultz?
It's Ed Schultz. He's the most listened to progressive talk host in America, Jimmy.
He drew the Peanuts character.
For the record, I'm going to say I hope Ed Schultz gets prostate cancer.
Oh, Jesus.
All right, then you got in 14th place Glenn Beck.
Glenn Beck.
He's a rising star with an edgy approach to issues, talk radio.
And he sure has a memorable name, The Glenn Beck Show.
Yes.
All right, look, we got to be in the top 20.
We
got
to be.
Let's relax.
Next page.
If we make the top 20, it's okay.
We got to be here.
Jim Bohannon.
Bohannon.
Sounds like banana, I guess. America's most experienced late-night talk show host, moderate generalist radio pro.
Mm-hmm.
Then you got, in 16th place, Alan Colmes.
Alan Colmes.
He stinks on ice.
Alan Colmes beat us out wherever we are on this list?
Alan Colmes beat us out.
Well, it's got to be close now. We got to be here soon because Alan Colmes, then we got to be like, what, next?
You got to think we're in our league now. I mean, Alan Colmes, come on.
Here we go.
All right. 17th place is Jim Rome. 18th place is Al Franken from Air America. 19th place is the transvestite, Dr. Joy Brown.
Dr. Joy Brown. And here we are. We got to be on 20.
And
the next
number
page.
20, finally.
Oh, what?
Uh, Joe Madison from WOL.
Does he do a cooking show?
The nation's preeminent issues, talk host, activist, operating from the African-American perspective.
Oh.
Joe Madison is in 20th place as far as the top talkers in America.
Dude, how did you guys only make top 25? I mean, there's no way you couldn't be in the top 25.
No, we got to be in
the top 25. Don't give it away, 25.
Jimmy. You have to be in the top 25.
All right, well, 21st place is Doug Steffen.
Who
or
is that?
Steven.
I haven't heard of him.
I don't even know. I've been in radio my entire life. I've never heard of Doug
Steffen.
Dude, he is an energetic dynamo.
And how the hell did Doug Steffen beat out number 22, Bill Handel? Because I know I would have voted for Bill Handel.
Oh, you got to vote for Bill Handel.
Who is Bill Handel?
Bill Handel is the heart and soul of KFI. He's one of the most... I'll tell you who Bill Handel is.
All right.
You naysayers. He's one of the most listened-to talk show hosts in America. And I like that because it's not generic. Also does syndicated weekly legal show.
Yeah. Ugh. Yeah. In the words of Jim Norton. Ugh.
Well, yeah, there it is. All right. Ugh. All right, number 23.
Well, we got to be in the top 25.
Opie and Anthony?
Nope.
No.
23, it's Dave Ramsey.
Dave Ramsey, this guy does a financial advice show. Okay.
We can't even beat on right. a financial
We can't
advice
beat
show.
The financial advice show. Kevin,
you
are on,
you even here?
You are on one of the worst shows in the history of radio.
Wait a minute now. Dave Ramsey, we've talked back in the in the office about like how in competitive radio, Dave Ramsey is the
it's
guy
all
to
about
beat.
Dave Ramsey.
It's That's all about target. Dave Ramsey.
Just so you know, Kevin, we're running down the list of the top talk radio hosts in America.
Right.
100. Top 100.
I believe in lowered expectations, so I like to go to the show that's not listed in the top 100.
Because
nobody expects anything from me.
We thought we'd be at least 25, but we can't find ourselves
who's
here.
Who's 24, though?
Well, 24 is some lady named Kim
Commando.
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 Look how they spelt it. It's like commando, only commando.
Oh, dude, you ready for
I'm
this?
I'm Kim Commando.
You ready for this?
Yeah.
If this isn't an insult, Kim Commando is the talk radio industry's leading personality in computer talk.
It's a computer talk show.
Talk advice show.
Opie, do you know how many computers there are in the world today? So I would say, fine. Kim Commando is ahead of her.
I find it surprising that Dr. Laura is still number five or up there.
I thought
everyone was up in arms about her because she said stuff about the gay community. And I hadn't heard that name in a long time.
Yeah, well, apparently she's very popular. Number five.
I miss number six. I would have thought he would have been higher.
A little higher, right? Well,
higher than Dr. Laura.
Bill O'Reilly, number 11. I thought he would have been higher, too.
We're still searching for us in this list. We're up to 25 with Bill Bennett.
Historical bright political figure, now heard in syndication by more than 2 million listeners weekly.
All right.
I've never heard of him.
You haven't been listening. Bill Bennett's on fire.
26 is Curtis and Kubi.
You got to give them a little bit.
Well, they should have been up on the list. They should have beat out Computer Talk Lady.
When the mob tries to kill you, you would think you'd make the top 30.
Right.
So, of course.
Michael Medved is 29.
Michael Medved's 29. George Nouri.
Worst critic 28. In the world.
George Nouri probably should have been a little higher on the list. I mean, that's a massive show. He took over for Art Bell.
Michael Medved's a movie critic?
Oh, yeah.
After
Siskel and Ebert used to do a show called At the Movies before it became, then they went off and started their own show called Siskel and Ebert.
Mm-hmm.
And when they left, Michael Medved and who was the other jackass who took over? It was Michael Medved and, God, I forget the other dude's name. But he was one of them.
Did they have a thing? Because, of course, the thumbs up was a huge thing.
The thumbs up, I believe they also used.
They used it, too?
Until
on original ripoffs.
I know. Until at least when Siskel and Ebert started their show, I think they might have cornered the market.
Couldn't you give it like two okie dokies where you make the circle with
Michael
your
Medved
fingers?
Probably would have given it two crosses up because he's pretty hardcore Christian.
Is he?
Yeah, he's one of those cats that like talks about how your movie is morally repugnant.
Oh, so he loved Dogma, I'm sure.
Yeah, he was right up his alley.
They used to rate some of these movies on the Christian. I was going out with a girl
that
and there
website?
Was like a Christian. At the time, it was like a pamphlet that the church gave out, and it was listed in one of these Christian newspapers, and they had a rating system for movies where it was family-oriented, and the last thing was condemned.
Right.
It was actually rated condemned.
Right.
And those were always the movies we went to see. We told the parents that we were going to go see
Alan Rankin is 18?
18. Well, we're up to 30, though, because we've got to be in the top 40.
Yeah, of course, you're top 30. Two Faces, the two guys,
John and Ken.
Wait, that isn't us. Who?
What?
John and Ken.
From KFI.
John Cobalt.
Consistently one of the most listened to talk shows in America.
In America.
And Ken Ciampou. C-H-I-A-M-P-O-U.
It's Ciampou. Ciampou.
Ken Ciampou.
Fancy spelling of Ciampou.
It's Ciampou because it's a radio name, and they spell it fancy like Ciampou.
Oh, that's the Ken Ciampou here.
Then there's 31, Ron Owens. 32, Spike Odell. 33 is Lionel.
Lionel.
34 is our good pal, Tom Likas.
That guy's good, though,
Tom
man.
Tom Likas!
Yeah!
He's
brave. You guys, I've never heard that show. Do you not like Tom Likas?
He's a douchebag.
It's repulsive. Really?
We worked with him for 10 minutes here in New York.
Right.
He was on WNEW with us for a while. And, yeah, he's really a prick to work around
I thought
here
he was
or with.
Was he here? Did he move out here? Because I thought he was like an L.A. personality.
He is an L.A. guy, but I guess you know New York's the number one radio market, so right. he kind of
so did
I guess
he actually physically
offer.
Come out here?
He physically came out here
and
to do radio out here. Oh, it just
he fell
miserably.
Twice.
Bombed.
He fell twice
bombed.
In New York so far.
He's one
now.
Of these guys, like, we like having fun with our female listeners.
Right.
We're nasty at times and stuff, but they all know we love women. We
right.
really do. This guy is just such a cock about women, and
a
when the word misogynistic
kind of
comes out, it's yeah. just, he's the poster boy. And you could tell it just came from chicks never, ever giving him the time of day when he was growing up. When it was, he's got, there are allegations of domestic violence in his house at a
really?
Christmas, after a Christmas party in Boston. He apparently went home, and it's alleged that he got into a fight with
this
his
made
wife
the newspaper, by
at,
the way.
House, at wow. his house and threw her into the fireplace. As
I'm
it
Tom
Likas!
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
and we just pictured, like, you know, ding, 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 with a fight going and the tree blinking nicely right. and then him just flinging her into the nice yule log in the fireplace.
Unbelievable. So, when you've reached a position where some people know who you are,
mm-hmm.
I think nobody should ever be causing violence to anybody else.
No.
Nobody should ever be causing violence to man on woman violence, particularly as a
right.
no-no. But when you've reached some level of, like, hey, people know your name.
Know you, yeah.
You cannot even think about hitting a woman anymore.
Your days are done.
You can't
doing
even, like,
that.
Sit there going, if I had any balls, I'd fucking smack her in the face. You can't think about it.
No.
To do that, that's just career suicide.
No.
Well, yet you can still be what number?
Hey, Dr. Ian Smith, how are you, sir?
There he is.
Number 34.
Well, the list goes on and on and on and on and on and on.
Of course it does.
I guess we can pick up the list a little later.
Yes.
We're up to 34, and your pals, Opie and Anthony, are
we'll see if we're in the top 50.
I think you're right around here.
All right. Well,
we got to be,
we'll get back to the list in a sec. Dr. Ian Smith, that's Kevin Smith.
Hi, how are you?
Hey, Kevin, how are you?
Good to meet you,
good
sir.
To see you.
And we got Gunnar Nelson on the phone here.
Gunman.
Gunnar.
Yo.
What's up, man? Sorry to make you wait there. We were waiting for Ian Smith to show up.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. No problem.
All right.
That's my man.
And, of course, we're talking about Celebrity Fit Club.
Yes.
Dr. Ian Smith is one of the panelists that actually gets to weigh them every week on the show.
It's a lot of fun, the weighing.
That's right.
Yes. Yes,
absolutely.
We get to enjoy Dr. Ian's teeth every week.
Gunner, don't start.
You do have some wonderful choppers on you there.
He does, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Floss. You do a lot of the flossing.
Floss and, you know, I
quite,
don't eat
quite
sweets.
Breathtaking. Really?
You look like a handsome Chris Rock.
Everyone says that.
Has he heard that?
And Chris Rock weighs about 10 pounds.
Well, you look like a fuller. Like
now
more,
you sound like a handsome Chris Rock. Put a little Chris Rock in that delivery right there.
Yeah, we heard that coming out.
Yeah.
So, and then Gunnar Nelson, if you were watching Celebrity Fit Club, took over for Jeff Conway, who had major, major problems there and went into rehab.
Yeah, he was really fucked up.
Nothing against you, Gunnar, but I was very bummed when they said goodbye to Jeff Conway because I thought it made great TV because he was such a mess on the show.
Oh, yeah. You know, there's great TV, and then there's just kind of like just dangerous to everybody around him. And it was pretty bad. But, you know, it was just the Benadryl. That's
yeah, but you weren't
please.
Quite as messed up like physically either.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at. So they get rid of Jeff Conway and like, all right, they gotta introduce a new fatty. And all of a sudden Gunnar Nelson walks out and he's like, I only got a 5-pack, I want a 6-pack.
Yeah,
I think
like,
I need to lose 2 pounds.
All right, join the rest of the world there, Gunnar.
Now guys, I was actually just coming up doing a radio show for Lifetime for a year, and you know what the hours are like, and all of a sudden doing a morning show, and I just did kind of let myself go. And I don't know, I was supposed to represent the millions of Americans who were not looking like they looked in high school. And I was carrying around an extra, I thought, like an extra 15 pounds. I wound up losing 30 pounds.
You lost 30 pounds on the show?
Well, I got to be honest with you. Gunnar, let me just say something here. When they said that Gunnar Nelson was coming, and I said, okay, fine, let me see a picture of him. And they showed me a picture. I was like, no.
Yeah, like, why?
Like, I was like, no, I can't do this. I mean, my credibility to the viewers are going to be like, reject him. And then, you know, after talking to Gunnar and saying, okay, fine, you'll represent people who only have maybe 10 or 5 pounds who can't lose it because they say, I can't lose the last 5 pounds, Dr. Ian. And I said, and then Gunnar was like crazy. Like, the man is crazy. He was like, he followed the diet to the T. Like, I was getting scared because he kept losing weight every time. And I was like, oh, my goodness. So, yeah. So to his credit, he's the hardest working guy.
It got kind of funny because, you know, he obviously lost the weight he needed to lose, and then he wanted to lose more. And I'm like, yeah, you go, man. Just turn anorexic in front of our eyes, please.
Get an eating disorder, please.
Right.
Celebrity Fit Club sponsors anorexia.
And then they have to do, like, these things, you know, what was it? Fit Camp, I guess it's called, right? And Gunnar Nelson's just kicking everyone's ass because he's like 165 pounds or whatever, 160 pounds.
It's in shape.
And you got a couple that were over 300, and everyone else hasn't, ran in years.
Yeah.
And he's just killing everybody, and everyone else is pissed off at him.
Yeah, but you know what? I got to tell you, the fit camps, you guys don't see the full fit camp of what happens. And sometimes on the sideline, you get pissed off because, these are celebrities, and they get pampered and stuff like that. But if you sign up on a show to get in shape, then you need to work out. I mean, that's what it's all part of. And, some friction about, whether the workouts were too hard and blah, blah, blah.
Too hard.
Nonsense.
And, I mean, right, it was nothing.
It was nothing. They were doing, like, 15-minute, like, drills, like, before, the challenge. I'm like, you guys, relax. I mean,
I don't want to do this. Where's craft services?
You had a whole bunch of people that were running the spectrum as far as their attitudes and what they were really there for. I mean, Kelly LeBrock was awesome. I mean, truly awesome.
Yes.
And driven and stuff. And then you had, people on the other end of the spectrum, which were like, you wondered why they were even there in the first place, seriously. And it was every single week.
I know why they were there. They just wanted FaceTime. They wanted exposure.
I was shocked at how Kelly LeBrock had let herself go.
Weird science, Kelly LeBrock?
Yeah. Dude, really? Probably one of the hottest.
She was still hot when she was fat. She was still hot.
I went on the radio and said, no, definitely. I said yes.
You know why? Because maybe if she was walking down the street and you saw her and went, wow, okay, for a chubby girl, that she's pretty hot. She was iconic as the hot chick of the 80s. When she comes out of that bathroom door in the bikini briefs and the little half shirt, that was so mega hot that even if she was a little chunky, it was like, oh, she fucked up, man. Fucked up.
Steven Seagal's a fatso now, though. He put on like 35 pounds.
Married? I never jerked off to Steven Seagal,
Jimmy. Speak for yourself, fella. That guy was quite a tussler.
What is the diet, may I ask?
Oh, sure. It's called the Fat Smash Diet.
Okay.
And basically, it's a four-phase diet that starts off with a detox.
Right.
And the crazy thing is that when all the celebrities saw my detox plan, it was 9-day natural detox. Oh, I can't do this. I can't just eat this stuff. Blah, blah. They come in after 9 days, they're losing 9 pounds, 8 pounds, 7 pounds, and they're like, oh, actually this thing works. I'm like, hello. I mean,
lemon juice, psyllium husk?
No, it's all fruits and vegetables.
Really?
You can't eat white potatoes, white rice, white bread, and no alcohol.
It's a racist diet.
I'll say that. Jesus Christ.
First time I've called a racist before, but okay.
Yeah, I saw us making some headway.
No Golden Girls, no Happy Days.
But no, the diet, it's a great diet. And the crazy thing is that when the people start stealing, like the cast, started stealing the diet because I made the celebrity sign a confidentiality agreement. Like, only you guys could see it. Next thing I know, I'm in a script meeting, and the director, I'm like, man, you're looking really good.
Oh, shit.
And he's like, well, I got to be honest with you. I'm doing your diet. And I'm like, what? I haven't even published it yet. What are you doing? So now Gunner, Young MC, Chaz, and Kelly LeBrock. Whew, those guys were
awesome. How much did Kelly LeBrock lose?
Kelly lost, I have my little notes here. Mm. Kelly lost 31 pounds. She started off at 175. She's now down to 144 and lost 8% body fat.
Wow. She was 175?
Yeah.
She was a big... She's that's why when she too, first though. Came on yeah, the show, she was
how
a
how tall
wreck.
Is she? 9'3"?
Tall girl.
She said on the show she was sick of being a sex symbol and just was like,
But you know what the
that was her excuse. They all have these cute excuses why there's stuff in their
like
face.
It was a conscious decision to just blow
yeah, like
look
I'm
like
so sick
shit.
Everyone's looking at me like a sex symbol. I'm going to just
no
live
one
my
beat
life
the Snapple,
and be whatever I want.
Snapple lady's excuse.
But I love
what
Kelly.
Was her
but,
excuse?
Her excuse
oh,
was
great, Kevin.
She
this is Wendy the Snapple
yeah,
lady?
Yeah. She was growing up as a not even growing up, she was a baby still.
Right.
And her parents had another kid.
Decide to have another kid.
And
so from that
and
day
she
forward,
started I'm, eating.
She just
that's,
wanted to eat.
Yeah.
That's her excuse for being as big as she is.
Yeah.
And wow. By the way, Celebrity Fit Club blew it. They should bring Wendy Snapple back every year.
Everybody says that.
When she's crying.
So we can just openly laugh at her.
When she's crying about not getting the attention from her parents, I love that shit.
Wendy's awesome. But let me tell you about Kelly. Kelly kept saying, you know, I blew up basically and stopped. I didn't want to be a sex symbol anymore. And then every
mission
weigh-in,
accomplished.
Well, but no, but every weigh-in that she came in losing 5-6 pounds, she wore tighter dresses.
Mm-hmm.
Cleavage started coming up, and I was like, you guys, I told the producers, let's do a montage of her saying, I don't want to look sexy anymore, and then show her in all these things, boom, 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 but they didn't go for it, but that would have been
good.
Why didn't they go for it? That's great.
Yeah, that's good TV right there.
Can we put Gunner in sexy things then?
Gunner?
Well, I just put me in Kelly's sexy things. That's fine with me.
Gunner's got one of those.
Make sure she's still in it.
Yeah,
Gunner and Nelson have one of the best Beavis and Butthead scenes ever. You remember that one, Gunner?
No, which one was that? Come on, guys.
Where you guys are playing, and they went, hey, who are these chicks?
These chicks are hot.
That's the best.
Hey, Gunner, the cast hated you, huh?
No, actually, I got along pretty well with just about everybody except for Tempest.
Tempest, she had an attitude, man. She did
Tempest
not want to be there.
Show, yeah.
I'm not saying a word. I got in trouble already for saying something on radio about her. I got all these hate emails that...
All right, don't say it on this show, but tell us what you said on the other show.
Look, all I'm saying is I feel sorry for Tempest. I think it just makes her life a whole lot harder on herself than it needs to be.
She didn't realize what she got herself into, it looks like.
Didn't want to work that hard?
No.
That it?
Did she lose weight?
Yeah, she lost. Tempest lost 19 pounds.
It really wasn't all just about losing the weight thing. It wasn't supposed to be. It was really supposed to be about your body's a reflection of what's going on inside.
She came across like a bitch on that show. I got to say it. Dr. Ian Smith's not going to come in.
I'm going to slowly do a little something because don't send me any hate emails saying I'm not a black anymore because I'm criticizing the black. Please, I don't want
to. That's what
that
you
nonsense.
Have to deal with.
Really?
Oh, it's nonsense.
Ian, what the heck does that have to do with anything?
Gunner, when you and I were on Wendy Williams, the emails I got after that show were like, basically, I lost my black card. It's like, are you crazy?
Oh,
because I can't criticize someone.
Does that mean there's a black card up for grabs?
I would like one. I'll take that.
I got one years ago from Chris Darden.
Where's that guy? Anyway, let me just say this, and I'll shut up about Tempest. My issue with Tempest is, listen, everyone is a celebrity in their own right. Like, you're amongst peers. Like, no one's bigger than anyone else. I mean, Kelly LeBrock in her day, like you said, was iconic.
Mm-hmm.
Bruce Valanche has been, you know, great these days. Like,
they were all bigger than Ant, who acts like he's the biggest celebrity on the show.
Who?
Ugh.
Ant?
Can I say it?
Ugh. Oh, but he's so flamboyant.
I actually love the show, but
I
can't stand watching him host that show. I hate it.
You could make the argument that Tempest Blood Show might have been the most... well known because that show was massive.
Show was huge
for so many years.
Yeah.
Which show?
Cosby Show. You know Jimmy.
No,
right?
You remember I remember her.
She was the middle girl, the middle daughter.
Curly hair.
Yeah.
But anyway, she lost 19 pounds. Hey Tempest, if you're listening or someone tells you, this is Dr. Ian. I love Tempest Bledsoe, but it's like let's not have attitude. I mean, do what you got to do. I mean, it's a show about losing weight and getting your butt kicked.
Yeah,
she did it to herself.
Isn't that what makes it like an entertaining TV for people to watch? Though they want to see somebody has to be the designated asshole.
Yeah.
Well, Jeff Conway was just he was
human
classic.
Train wreck.
And then he comes back from rehab and he brings the Benadryl box to prove that he wasn't on drugs. He just happened to have Benadryl when they filmed him all fucked up.
Are you freaking kidding me? I'm gonna set the record.
I know
because he came after me about that. Listen, Benadryl may cause drowsiness, but 2 Benadryl does not cause what's called an ataxic gait, where you're walking around like you're freaking, you had, you know, 10 bottles of whiskey. I mean, the guy was falling asleep. He was slurring. He couldn't have a coherent conversation. He was a train wreck. He was harmful to people. That's why he had to go to rehab. I mean,
Steve C., our own producer. Same thing.
Wow.
And he was trying to pass for being a Benadryl.
He
being affected by Benadryl to a doctor.
Kevin, it made
Can
great,
you believe that?
That's
it made for great TV because they kicked him off the show. He was such a mess. He comes back like 30 days later or something like that, and everyone is like has tears in their eyes. Like, oh, my God, he's taking care of his problems. This is pretty cool. And then he gets up there and goes after Ian saying, look, it was Benadryl that day. I'm
right away.
By that. And
he comes at me, and I'm
apparently
like,
a hickey from Kanicki is like 2 Benadryl.
I saw Jeff about 5 days ago.
Yeah.
And man,
I hope he gets his stuff together because it's not together yet.
Nah, I bet Benadryl sales went up.
Totally.
People go, like, that really? Gets me that fucked up.
Benadryl gets you fucked up? Give me it.
Yeah, and I got another rash of emails from people. How could you as a doctor say that Benadryl doesn't do that? Hello? I mean, are you kidding me? Did you see him? I mean, his own doctor, Dr. Drew, said the guy has an addiction problem. I mean, then the emails. Dr. Ian Benadryl can do that. I've taken Benadryl. Yeah,
stop
whatever.
Reading your
Yeah, don't
emails.
Read the emails. Yeah. Don't read the message boards. I mean, we've all been through this.
We'll walk you through.
The only time you read email is if it's from a girl and it has like a pic attachment. If she's fucking... That's it.
JPEG, right?
But I didn't see the final show. I've seen every show. I didn't see the final one. I had a crash early last night, so.
Can I tell you what happened?
Yeah, I don't care.
Okay.
It's not like it's going to be a huge surprise.
Yeah, but, okay, so the winner was Young MC.
Okay. How much did he lose?
38 pounds. He went from 278 to 240. And then the next was Bizarre, the rapper, Eminem's crew. He went from, he lost 32 pounds. Then Kelly lost 31 pounds. Chaz could have lost more, Gunner. I mean, she had 3 weeks where she stalled. She just stalled, but she lost 24 pounds, even with three bad weigh-ins. And then Bruce...
She's got to stop wearing the man clothes, though.
Who's I know Chassie Bono?
She's great. Seems really nice, has a great personality, but the men clothes, I understand it's her lifestyle, but man,
lifestyle,
dude,
yeah.
Soften up a little bit, please.
Remember when Sonny and Cher used to bring her out as a little kid during the Sonny and Cher variety hour?
And now she's
good night, Chastity. She had little pigtails and waving.
Well, on Celebrity Fit Club, she's wearing blazers. She's wearing men's blazers.
There's also nothing decidedly heterosexual about a dress. Easy access is easy access.
There you go.
All right. I like that.
Guy makes a valid point.
Very valid.
Yeah.
So anyway, so these guys did well. You know, Kelly's team won.
Hey, what's her name? End up gaining weight.
Countess Vaughn. She gained 4 pounds.
Wow, really? Somebody gained weight on?
She's from the Parkers.
She's a little
Don't
thing.
You know the Parkers? I got nasty emails about that. Dr. Ian, how could you be a black person and not watch the Parkers?
It's a UPN show,
about?
Isn't it?
Wow.
Was it
I'm
UPN
serious.
Show?
I was like, what? I have to watch every black show in America? Like,
yeah.
Anyway, she gained 4 pounds and, you know.
That's funny, man.
Well,
that's
I'm going to stay. I'm not going to say anything. Gunner, you say something. Gunner, why am I talking?
Yeah, Gunner.
Well, because we got 9 people talking at the same time.
Oh, okay.
I'll tell you what. She was full of it. This girl Countess made everything up about her whole side story. Oh, my life is so hard. I'm not losing weight every week because I'm under so much stress and I'm in a divorce and these tears were coming. It was all bullshit. Whole thing was bullshit. She was there for the paycheck. She fooled the producers. She said she wasn't going to follow the diet. She wasn't going to work out. She was going to collect her check every week. And that's it. And that's what she did. So she gained 4 pounds. But here's what I have to say. For all these people who were on the show, some people took took advantage of the situation. Some people just totally wasted it. And that was their choice to do. Look, someone came to me and said, I'm going to give you a good paycheck. I'm going to give you all the support, a nutritionist, a real instructor, a really hot psychiatrist, and a fixed amount of time to get your life together. Who wouldn't take someone up on that?
Yeah.
Some people, funny enough, didn't. And Countess was one of those people. I couldn't understand it.
See, that's why God is a soldier. That's why he was the best, because he and Kelly were the best. And got Young, because they were very serious. Like, they wanted to leave the show after. It was only 100 days. And they wanted to leave the show looking much better, feeling much better, and look at him now.
And they go back to their regular lives for 2 weeks, right? And you fly back out to L.A. every 2 weeks,
it seems like?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, I actually live in Nashville, so I was doing the commute and stuff. But, you know, Ian, I also, your diet really did work for me, because guys, I had a third less time than everybody else. I was replacing Jeff.
Yeah, that's right. And he only did it in 60 days.
Where do we find this diet?
It's on fatsmashdiet.com or amazon.com.
Fatsmashdiet.com.
It's a book.
Put it out as
a
book.
Do you have copies?
I just came from South Carolina. I just told Roland I wish I had. I'll send you guys some.
I'd love a copy. I need
you
to lose
it. How much you need?
I
lost a lot of weight, actually.
I want to lose probably 15 pounds.
That's it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's easy.
Oh, well, I think you look at me and go, hey, fatso, lose 40.
No.
Thanks, Doc.
No. 15.
What's the easiest way to lose 10, 15 pounds?
I'll tell you
Quick
what,
tip.
You got to start eating.
Yes.
You got to start
eating. Bunch of meals a day, right?
Small meals, multiple meals, like 4 or 5, seriously. Like, people think starvation helps. Starvation just slows your metabolism down. You just end up gaining weight.
It's completely counterintuitive. When he told me, hey, look, you know, you got to turn up the wick, what I was doing, I was working on the show and working on music. And the day I went, wow, you know, I'm really hungry. And I would gorge on one meal and then go to sleep on that. And I was putting on weight like crazy. And when someone says,
every 2 hours you got to be eating. I was eating, I mean, Ian said like four meals a day. I was eating like seven or eight.
Wonderful.
Every two hours I was eating. And my God, man, every week it was like, wow, I just lost 4 pounds.
But you got to eat healthy, though, right? Like, you know, I went to McDonald's last night for the first time in months. Honestly, God, because I wanted to fart in studio. And it didn't work. I had two cheeseburgers. And I was just suicidal. I'm like, my mouth is dry. Like, why did I do this to myself?
When are we doing the fart off this week?
Probably, yeah. I just wanted to give you a little sample, but I just couldn't do it.
I don't understand why we're not on this list.
I'm not with
great topics
participating.
Like this.
All right, so I have to eat more?
Yeah, I'm... In 2 months, you will lose 15 pounds. That's my commitment to you.
Yeah.
I'm going to work with you. Seriously.
I just did, last year, I did, during the summer, I went on OptiFast. You know, mm-hmm. It's like a liquid diet kind of thing. It's 800 calories a day, and I lost 70 pounds over 3 months. Three and a half months.
Yeah, you lost
a lot
of weight.
But that's like, you got to give up solids for a while. But the re-entry is difficult.
That's my problem right there, is that these programs where it's like liquid diets, well, okay, when you're done, then what? Yeah,
true.
What are you going to do?
You got to
eat
slowly
regular
foods bring
again.
Food back in. And the moment you start eating again, you're putting
up
pounds,
up.
But it's not all of it. You just got to kind of figure
that's
it out.
That's why my program is like this four phase where mm-hmm. we do a detox, then you slowly, you can eat pizza and stuff on my diet, but you work up to that. Like, you just don't kind of go crazy after the detox. So.
Right.
No,
it's also
my thing had to be easy because I'm touring all the time. I'm all over the country. I'm airports and bad hours and all that kind of stuff, and it had to work. And the liquid diet thing obviously would work, but it totally changes your lifestyle. This thing, I just fit it into my lifestyle, and it worked fine.
I find it harder to work out on the road. I don't know. I like the gym and like where I live. Like, I go to the road, they have these shitty fitness rooms. That's just depressing. Everything's
dirty. 50-year-old ladies, like, that's their workout. So, like, old, like, Universal sets, you know, when I grew up as a kid. I mean, people don't use that stuff anymore. It's a waste. They say we have a fitness club. I'm like, yeah, right.
Yeah. Hey, he's worried about dirty workout equipment. Yes, he goes to Brazil and fucks hookers without any contraception.
That was one incident,
yeah,
twice.
Why don't you tell Dr. Ian Smith about your diet there, Jimmy?
Yeah, tell
your
me.
Late-night diet.
Occasionally, I've dabbled with, you know, I was in Brazil, you know.
And I love that, Brazil.
Me too. You Copacabana?
Ooh, wait.
Yeah, it's fantastic. You go to the little houses. What's the word for them? There's a word for the whorehouse. What?
Whorehouse.
No, not brothel.
Not brothel. No, it's a Brazilian.
It's a Brazilian word. I know what you're saying too. For the record, I didn't frequent them. But.
No. For the record, and let me state.
But there was one called the Monte Carlo, which I would go to with Patrice and a couple other guys.
It might
help
you with the calories of what you were eating.
Sex is a great... Let me tell you, one of the best workouts is sex. Well, I'm not kidding you. Like, one of the best way to...
Not the way I do it. It's like doing one push-up and falling asleep.
Can I tell you something? When I went to Rio, right, we went to this place, and we thought we were at a nice little restaurant, right? And all of a sudden, I said to my guys, we just landed. I'm like, oh my goodness, these are the hottest babes in the world, right? And they're giving us the eye. So we're like, whoo-wee, Americans, you know, coming up.
They were hookers.
Of course.
Yeah.
They were
not
completely
only were they
working.
Hookers, they were probably tranny hookers, man. Those Brazilians got those she-males that are fucking to die for.
I was obsessed with, honestly, I didn't want a tranny. I was like so... I saw so many chicks, I'm like, that's a tranny. And they're like, no, it's not. I'm like, it's a fucking tranny. And I wouldn't touch half the chicks down there for that reason.
Yeah. If you look at she-male porn on the web, which I do quite often, apparently, because I can give you the distinction.
You certainly can.
The Brazilian she-male sites have chicks that guys that absolutely fucking look like girls.
Are you a Joey Silvera fan, are you?
I don't know. Who's that?
Okay, good. Good cover.
Jimmy will tell you.
No guy should die before they go to Rio. I'm telling you. No guy should.
I've spent three trips. I can't go back. I'm afraid because there's so much crime down there. It's a very dangerous area. I mean, the drug lords really do run the whole city from the projects. Yeah. So it's very frightening to be there.
Favelas. That's what they're called. Favelas. Right,
but the little whorehouses are called something. If Patrice is listening right now, he's screaming at his radio. I cannot remember what they're called, but it's just too dangerous to go back.
What was the diet you were talking about? What was he eating?
Well, it's up to Jimmy if you want to tell.
Oh, he's just there was
and
one.
He can help you out with how many calories that might be.
There was right. One, there was one girl in the whorehouse who I did have sex with 2 days in a row, and I had a condom, but it remained in my wallet, and I kind
Are
of
you
went.
Serious?
Went unprotected twice with the same Brazilian hooker. It can't happen to me. That's why I did it.
No, seriously. Like, I'm,
Jesus.
No, I got to ask you a serious question.
It was a diet called I Dare You, God.
That doesn't scare you? Like, I would be...
No.
I couldn't get up. If I'm in that situation, literally, I'd be so scared that I couldn't get up. Like, I wouldn't be able to do it, I don't think.
Well, especially, it's a foreign country with a hooker.
But it was because she kept going, you special, you special.
Oh.
And I'm like, all right, I'm special.
Tell them about the log.
Well, that's what I was. There's got to be some kind of oral thing going on here because he keeps hinting at calories.
What?
All right. Well.
Come on, dude.
She crapped in your mouth, sir. Is that what
you said? No, I would never. No, no, not in a foreign country.
How many
that's
calories?
Disgusting.
Not in a foreign country.
I don't know what they're eating in Brazil.
All right, there you
Jimmy's,
go.
Well, Jimmy's on a liquid diet sometimes.
Sometimes he's
not
on a
big deal. I've had some golden shower. You know, who hasn't?
Oh.
Where he's had to put down the plastic on the floor of the bathroom.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You ever see Lethal Weapon 2?
Yeah.
When the guy gets shot in the office, that's kind of what my bathroom looks like during sex. Lovely. I'm an enchanting individual. But again, I want to lose 15 pounds. I'm tired of paying for it, and I want to lose 15 pounds.
And apparently drinking piss isn't working, so he's looking for something
that
else.
Will never change. That's actually just, you know, show me who's boss. You are.
There was an article I read online yesterday, most disturbing article I've ever read in the newspaper, about this dude who was arrested in Ohio for they still can't figure out what the exact charge is, but I guess a parent was in the bathroom with their kid, and they saw this dude kind of leering at their kid, so they alerted the cops. Cops arrested the dude, and in the interrogation process of talking to this guy, who I guess wasn't a suspect, they just kind of brought him in for questioning, he started talking about how into drinking children's urine he is, little boys' urine, and he has this elaborate system where he'll go into a public bathroom, turn the plumbing off, stick a cup of some sort in both the urinal and the toilet, wait till kids use it, and then leave, collect it, and drink it. And his quote was, you can find it online, you can Google it. The quote was, I feel like I'm drinking their youth.
Jeez. Oh, so it's kind of a vampire-like
thing. First of all, that's not what I said. I read the same story, and I mean, like, with a chick I've done stuff like that, that guy should be executed because he's into, he's a child toucher. Yeah, he's a kid toucher.
And that's the thing, he was convicted of, like, some form of child rape 13 years prior. I mean, that's why they might have arrested him, I guess. He's
yeah.
Violation of some kind
but
of
keep
sure
letting him out of jail.
Natural law.
They'll come up with something.
You know, I think we should be more extreme. Seriously, with molesters, like some of those other countries.
That's the crime we should really like institute the death penalty for.
Yeah, because that it's like
rape.
Kid,
I mean, it can't be just nasty. Like if you kill somebody, you get killed. They've
I think
got
Gunner
really...
got bored.
Gunner
got bored. I think he just hung up.
Gunner,
no, he's gone.
Mister
doesn't want to be part of this conversation.
I know.
He's like, what? Piss drinking? I'm out of here.
What? Yeah, I've heard enough. Thank you.
It's like I'm close to a comeback. God damn it! I can't be part of this.
Yeah, right.
Well, you say now about being more extreme with child molesters.
Yeah, because I just think that, I mean, you got, like, the weakest of the weak who cannot protect themselves, okay, and you have adults preying on them. I mean, that's worse than murder, I think, because these kids afterward have to live the rest of their lives.
Oh, the trickle-down is intense.
Yeah.
Like, basically, you've ruined one person's life, and you probably, they wind up being involved in child molestation themselves.
They're
going to be like a carrier, and peripherally
totally,
they're going to affect
totally.
Everybody.
So the trickle-down is insane.
It's unbelievable. The ripple's ridiculous.
I agree. Kill them.
Sometimes murder, I mean, you walk in, you know, your girl's there with another guy or something like that. It hits you spur of the moment like that. Sometimes murder is completely reasonable.
Crime of passion.
Crime of passion, things like that. That, there's no way to rationalize it. It's not reasonable.
I was in the heat of the moment.
I
shut off the plumbing.
Something happened.
And the recidivism rate is like, what is it, like 80% or so? It's disgustingly high. It's not like most of them get better. They're just fucking
There's that National Registry website where you can go and enter your zip code and see. And not just the, and this isn't a full list of all the child molesters. These are just the ones they've caught.
Yep.
And it's fucking frightening when you
look around your area.
Yeah.
Really?
Oh yeah. And you can find out how many registered.
Doesn't matter where you live. You'll see a lot of dots.
You'll see tons of
them. You'll see a lot of dots.
And I think the scariest part about it is the ones that aren't listed. Just knowing, if these many are listed, how many more are out there that we don't know about? Horrible.
Well, we watched that. What was that special? 2020.
Perverted Justice.
Perverted Justice, where they have the hidden cameras. Dateline. Hidden cameras in a house. People go online, pose as children, and invite them over their house.
Oh yeah, I saw that.
And the hidden cameras are there, and
another
these guys
great
showed
TV
up
show, by the
in
way.
3 days. 55, I think, or 53 guys showed up.
Did they arrest them?
For the every single
Is
one of them.
Is that considered entrapment or not?
Whatever it's considered,
no,
I don't think
fine.
They gave a
and
shit.
One guy they released, they said, you know, okay, you know, be good, blah, blah, blah. He promised them. And a week later, the guy comes back again.
Outside the McDonald's, and then the guy's probably thinking, it couldn't happen again, and he's going to get that young dick, and all of a sudden the camera crew, and he's like, fuck! And he's like, why would you come back?
crazy.
But episode three, they finally started arresting these guys because the first two they did, they just let them go.
Yeah, it was just a news report.
But I'm
and
sure
the
they
reporter
were
would come out and confront them with like cameras in their faces and ruin their
and
lives.
You know what happened right. with Dateline? They were probably getting a lot of email like,
going,
"What the
hey,
fuck are you guys doing? Letting these people go?
The guy isn't working anymore. He loses his wife, his job, and everything, but he's still walking around, you know." So these guys, they arrested
and
him.
Rightfully so, man.
Who
let
is hot
let
girls?
The life be ruined.
Oh, the hot girls. This is Pal Talk. We have a lot of fun with this.
Oh wow!
See, we're on camera over here.
Right.
And they could all see us. And then we have various,
ooh-wee.
You know, it's always better to pop the girls up than, you know, the guys.
Yeah.
You missed this morning. The 7 we started, there was a very hot couple from Long Island banging.
Having
for
sex.
Us.
Yeah. For
that's
us,
how we started
right
today's show.
That's how we
you
started
show. You
could
see it?
Show.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
This Pal Talk is amazing.
Yeah. Why do you guys bring me to 10 o'clock? What's wrong with you guys? That's discrimination.
Yeah. Man. Maybe Beach Bunny. Beach Bunny, you want to give a little show over here?
Please, could
she's,
you,
she's very nice. If she could just flash a little
show
bit.
The good doctor your bosoms.
Me, there you go.
Hold on.
Let me bring this over.
There you are.
There we go.
Wow.
See, isn't that great?
Wow. XM is unbelievable. Holy cow. I'm an XM convert.
Isn't that nice?
Holy cow.
Thank you, Beach Bunny.
She's lovely.
Yeah.
19 years old. Healthy young bosoms.
How do you find these guys?
They just come on the, they come on Pal Talk. They got the cameras. You should see what happens in some of these other rooms. There are rooms that are, you go into the adult room, categories, there's bi, man on man, woman, it's just rooms where there's hundreds of guys just jacking off on camera. Wah, wah, wah.
I know,
that's
you gotta go under
do.
An assumed name so nobody recognizes you. They recognize your floor.
Hopefully they don't see a familiar tattoo or something.
That dude's wow. wearing a Silent Bob coat.
that?
We should take a break. You want to hang? Right. It's up to you, Dr.
Yeah, I'll hang. I love this. My first XM deal.
We only got like 10 minutes left in the show anyway. Right. So, and you're blown up. You started on local TV. I remember seeing you on the
remember
local
that? WNBC?
News.
Yeah. Yeah. Those are the days, huh?
You did the medical...
medical correspondent.
Yes.
Now look what I'm doing. Now I'm chasing around celebrities with attitude.
Right.
Oh, boy.
Are you guys going to bring Wendy back for the next show?
I got to tell you, she's got the number one hit on the website. Everyone keeps saying, bring her back, bring her back. You know who I want? Tanya Harding.
Is she a fatty now?
Holy shit.
Kind of blew up.
The Insider's been doing a bunch of things with her recently.
God,
because of the Olympics.
It.
She is massive.
You wouldn't recognize her. Seriously. Like, she's unbelievable. I mean, I'd get her on my diet. I would work her butt out. I'm telling you.
How many pounds do you think she gained? 50?
Minimum. She's probably 70.
Is she still with Jeff Galooly?
No, no.
You remember the guy?
Jeff
How could you
Galooly.
Not? His fucking his cock was, it was the, well, very impressive, and he really banged her well on their honeymoon and then released it. How do you not love Jeff Galooly? Jesus, his name should be on the dollar bill.
I just know the most interesting thing about that porn was afterwards she had a bunch of his fucking spunk in her hand, and she held it up to the camera.
Yeah.
It's such a weird way to end it.
I don't remember that part.
Happy honeymoon.
I don't think I made it that far.
Remember this?
Oh, baby.
So strange. Strange.
All right, we'll continue with Kevin Smith and Dr. Ian Smith. Are that two Smiths?
Two Smiths.
Yes. I just realized that.
No, oh, dear. Yeah.
More on the way. We're back with Kevin Smith and Dr. Ian Smith from Celebrity Fit Club. Hey, what happens to these celebrities after the show?
Well, I got to tell you, Gary Busey from last season.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm in the gym working out, Upper East Side. My phone rings, the L.A. number. It's Gary Busey. And the guy is like, won't get off the phone. Man, I love Gary, but I'm like, dude, I'm working out. He starts like getting emotional. So I'm like, I move to the corner because I don't want to sound like, you know, some wimp like having this emotional conversation. And the guy looks great. He lost all that weight. He's kept it all off. And he now works for the Today Show.
But he's
Tonight
lunatic.
Show as a correspondent.
He's a friggin' lunatic.
Yeah, but see, let me tell you something. The difference between him and Jeff Conway, he's a good lunatic. Like, like Gary had all those accidents and he recovered and half his head was gone and he just, you know, he just loved the world.
Yeah, I would call him colorful.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Colorful.
He doesn't mean any harm. He doesn't mean any harm.
I met Gary Busey years ago. I was opening for Dice and Gary Busey showed up and I met him in the dressing room and I wanted to meet him. He put his arm around me and he told me the same joke three times and tickled me. He's a fucking man's man and he tickled me and he hurt me and I just kept laughing every time he told the same joke. I'm like, ah, good one.
That's Busey. That's Busey. I wish he was there when Jeff was doing his.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man. Because he said to me, Dr. Ian, if I was there, I would have snapped his sternum. That's his favorite move. I would have snapped his sternum. He's an old football player.
So why didn't you guys keep Jeff Conway on there? Because that's the type of shit I love in my reality.
I know,
TV.
I know.
Just keep it as real as possible.
But the guy, in all honesty, the guy is dangerous. Like, the guy was, you saw him explode on Harvey. First of all, Harvey was going to jump over that table. Like, I physically had to restrain Harvey because he was going to.
Harvey. Harvey.
Who's Harvey? Harvey who?
The drill sergeant.
He's the drill sergeant.
He's the mean guy.
Right on.
I'm the nice guy. He's the mean guy. Right Linda's the sexy girl. But anyway, Harvey was going to kill him. And so it got to the point where he had threatened so many people on the show. He had got Harvey pissed off. I'm worried about Harvey. They couldn't do it.
I just wish they would play it out. You know, like the Bonaducci show, they played it out. It was kind of cool.
I didn't see the end of that.
That was a little weird, that Bonaducci thing.
Didn't he try to kill himself or something?
Yeah, he tried to kill himself. He's shooting up steroids
On
the show. I mean, they're showing him.
They showed him shooting up?
Shooting up steroids.
And what does shooting up steroids do for you?
Makes him that big, nasty animal
manic.
He tends to be.
Like Lyle Alzado. Remember Lyle Alzado?
Uh-huh.
I mean, that's all he did.
He's a workout fiend. So he did the steroids and all. And it made for great TV because they played it out. They said, all right, we'll play this out.
And what happened at the end of the show?
And Hollywood ending. So, you know.
He learned a lesson.
That's probably why they played it out, because they knew in the end it was going to be okay.
But they'd have him at, like, a marriage counselor, just yelling at the marriage counselor, yelling at his wife, just going crazy.
They showed him go off and start drinking again.
Really?
He was
clean and sober.
Yeah, I used to do his show, the other half, when it was on, and I got to tell you, like, he was the best one. Because the guy would do anything. Like, he'd go way off script. So, as a guest, you love having a host who's going to just roll with the punches, freak the script. But
that was like the man version of The View.
Right. You were involved with that?
I used to go all the time with those guys. They were fun. They were fun.
Jesus.
It was like the dude from Saved by the Bell.
Mario. With the dimples and all the girls loved him and blah, blah, blah.
Are you guys casting for the next season?
Right now. We need some good...
Any names?
They're looking at this guy. You may not know him. This big black dude, a bone crusher. He's a rapper. He's got like crazy hair. Like if you saw him,
was he in Bone Thugs and Harmony or something?
I think so. He's one of those groups. But he was like, he's huge. He's like bigger than Bizarre, I think. So they're looking at him, and I don't know. They keep it close to the vest.
Patrice O'Neill say no because Patrice, as funny as Patrice, I'm not even shitting on him. I mean, he would be hilarious
He would never.
Oh, you know probably who else? Carney Wilson, I think. They're trying to talk to.
She gained weight again?
But she lost a lot
after
of weight.
She did. She was like the first one, the big celebrity to have the surgery. But, you know, here's a mistake people make. They think that surgery is going to cure them forever.
Right.
No way. If you don't change what you eat and exercise, you're going to gain it back. She gained. Right.
Big Kev had the surgery.
Yeah.
You did?
He used to be 600 pounds or close to it.
Yep. Are you? No, you guys.
Yeah, no bullshit.
Oh, my God.
No bullshit.
Down to what? 280 now.
From 600.
Yeah, but did you change your stuff, though?
Had to, right?
Mike's not on there.
Mike ain't working.
Eric, put that on or I'll smash you.
Now it's on. Okay.
It's, I'm down to about 280. I had to change some of my eating habits, obviously, but, I mean, overall, I didn't make an entirely drastic change.
But do you exercise?
Yeah, but not any more or less frequently than I did when I weighed 600 pounds.
But see, most people at 600 aren't exercising. They're just sitting around in the bed.
Yeah, did you work out? Yeah, I walked to the end table.
No, this guy could move. When he was 600, he could still move.
Wow.
We did a celebrity softball game, and the guy can move.
Oh, my God, right?
Remember that? What do you do here?
Whatever I'm told.
He hangs out.
Uh-oh, he's your guy.
Guest us fine guests like Kevin Smith.
He just had the surgery where he had the skin removed, the excess skin.
Did you? I didn't know that part, really.
Which apparently is one of the most dangerous friggin' surgeries you could have. I got three I'm dying calls from Kev where it was like, well, this is it, bro. The priest has come in, and it's... Like,
so they just took off extra skin, like the stuff that's left over.
Yeah.
Wow. How long is the mend on something like that?
It wasn't very long, except for the fact that I was severely complicated. So.
Right.
But the problem with that is that when you do something like that, you ruin your electrolytes. Like, your body has a balance of chemicals and stuff.
Right.
And when you do something like that, take that much stuff off, you throw your body into, like, it gets haywire. And so it seems like, oh, what's the big deal? They're chopping skin off. But then your internal chemistry is all messed up. I mean, that's... Wow, congratulations, man. I mean...
That's true. They had to readjust my chemistry. So.
Yeah. Congratulations. Thank you.
All change per stomach.
That's it.
Yeah.
I mean, people on my diet, I mean, I'm trying to help people before they get to your point. I mean, obviously, you need, at 600 pounds, you probably had some medical complications, too, like diabetes or high blood pressure.
I had nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing. I didn't even have sore joints or anything.
What led you to the surgery, then?
Because I knew that, you know, I was entering my 30s or in my 30s, and I knew that eventually it was going to catch up with me, so I had to do something about it.
So it was more preventative than anything
else. Right. And I was diagnosed with... certain intestinal problems, and so this was a good solution for a lot of things.
I remember the first time I went to get my throat checked because I had tonsillitis, and the doctor used the term morbid obesity, and I was like, what's
that? Oh, my God.
What does that mean? And he was just like, well, you're overweight to a dangerous, potentially dangerous place.
Wow.
Had no idea that that term existed. And horrible. Jeez. When somebody says morbid
obesity. Obesity is bad enough, but when it shot past unpleasant and landed on morbid.
Right. It's like all that's left is creepy obesity.
Yeah. All right, let's go to the phones here. Creepy. Jeff in Pennsylvania. Jeff?
Hi, O&A.
Hey.
Little Jimmy.
What's up, man?
Kevin, love your movies.
Thank you.
Dr. Ian, I'm a trucker. I was in the military. I weighed 180. Now I'm like 290. And I was wondering if there's anything you can do like for truckers specifically that could help them, you know,
lose some
weight.
Yeah, I actually had like 5 or 6 truckers email me who are doing well on the diet now. I mean, it's just that, you know, I can't obviously explain the whole diet to you on air, but if you get the book, my email's on the back of the book. You can email me. I mean, I really try to help people. So it's the fatsmashdiet.com, fatsmashdiet.com, and I can definitely help you. I mean, you know, but you got to work. You know, the problem is people want to lose weight, but they're not ready to lose weight.
Mm-hmm.
Like Countess Vaughn from the show, she wasn't ready. She shouldn't have been there, mm-hmm. you know? And instead, she's crying. All the time. She wasn't ready. So, dude, if you're ready, I mean, get the book and email me.
Yeah, I definitely want to get back, you know, when I was in the military and shape and everything. But I find it real hard driving 11 hours a day, and I'm just really tired.
I got you, man. Seriously. Email me.
All right, Jeff. All right. Thank you. Let's say hi to John in Jersey.
What kind of weird country has America become, man? Where it's like truckers used to call into radio shows and be like, I need a pocket pal.
Yeah.
I'm on a job on the road, and now they're like, how do I lose weight? We're men in this country.
What do you got today, John?
Hey, what's going on, boys? Kevin, I live over in Hazlitt, not too far from where you saw.
Right on, the Hazlitt Multiplex. I used to go there all the time.
When I first moved over here, man, I went into the store, the clerk store, and I got to tell you, you were right, and the guy got wigged out. Out of me because I thought, you know, being a tool at 32 years old with nothing to do and going to check out the clerk store. He just is like,
the clerk store.
You gotta leave. Buy something or leave. Just get out. I got other things going on. And
love the attention. That amazes me.
Is the lot still empty in front?
It. The lot, right across the street, still wide open.
Still wide open. What is wrong with that area that hasn't been built on? Jesus Christ.
I don't know. And real estate in that area is pretty inexpensive, too.
Yeah.
Like, pretty darn inexpensive.
Hey, by the way, you were right about Jersey Girl.
In what way?
You said last year when you boys interviewed you on the phone that, you know, a lot of people checked it out after a while. You know, it wasn't that bad. And, you know, it really was. I mean, it's a chick flick.
Total
chick
flick.
It's kind of like a guilty pleasure, but it was actually a pretty good movie overall.
Oh, I appreciate that, sir. Thank you.
You did a great job in Clerks of framing those two establishments because there's so much more to that building.
Yeah, there's a lot more.
And I absolutely thought it was just the convenience store and the video store.
Yeah. I got my like first and second tattoo there. And then there was a place at the very end that used to be a series of rotating restaurants. Like a restaurant would come in, like a diner, you know, mm-hmm. grill, and they would leave within a year. And then finally, this obedience school took it over. And I don't know, or fighting school. We're not sure whether it's dog training or if it's like some kind of people like fighting training. Because they have like a pit bull like drawing with a fucking mask on their sign out front.
Yeah.
But you never hear dogs, and it just looks like people learn some kind of fighting style.
Could
in there.
Be either, yeah. Yeah.
Hey, we got 30 seconds left in the show.
Ah, damn it.
We're on a master computer. They just shut us down after after the show. So, Dr. Ian Smith, thanks from Celebrity Fit Club.
Hey, guys, it's great.
I got on DVR. I'm going to watch the final episode when I get home from this. So.
Cool, thanks.
I love the show, so continue success.
You guys.
And Kevin Smith, what can we say?
And Kevin, thanks so much for coming in.
Oh, thanks for having me.
I didn't gush, but I swear to you, you are huge to me.
You rock,
I'm a huge fan.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you, man.
All right, Ron and Fez up next. Thanks, guys.